The safe harbor gives broadcasters a green light if they want to pump out garbage over the airwaves. Anything goes, the FCC has said, after midnight up until 6 a.m.
Are we on camera now? Are we?
Yeah, we're actually live on camera. You're taking a viewer's...
Can you guys hear me now?
Yes, I can hear you.
You can see me on TV?
Yes, I see you fine.
All right, fine. Thank you.
Okay.
All right.
We must explain that to those who haven't been listening to the radio program. We're at Howard Stern, where this morning we're expecting the visit of the amazing Kreskin. And it's been about as much fun as you legally cram into a radio studio.
All right, Gordon. All right, be quiet now. Okay. Let me say something. Gordon, just shut up.
Please, Howard. See, you're so rude.
First of all, what I'd like to say is, and I hope that Rupert Murdoch is watching this morning.
Okay, now...
Because a good point can be made here. This morning, what happened?
Nothing.
The camera's
still
on me?
Still on it. You're still on it.
With one camera, they're doing this. Put the camera back on me. He has nothing to say. He's a puppet. Come here. Put the camera back on me. I got to direct this whole thing.
Yes, well, this is just like your show.
There was a party political statement coming up. Was it worth hanging? Was it worth hanging around for?
Come here. Just put the camera back on me.
Well, no, we'll be back after this break. Don't go away.
I told you. You're never going to say one word.
I mentioned Rupert Murdoch,
and the camera goes off of me.
Yeah, but that is exactly. They would have gone to black if I didn't.
Really?
And they just said.
I wanted to talk to Rupert Murdoch.
You can call him.
This person.
Hi, guys, did you ever throw up and get big chunks in your beard?
I never let these guys throw up on a beard.
Thanks.
Thank you, Frank. There it goes. Any other questions? Yeah.
What's the worst thing you ever found in your beard?
I haven't checked lately. This morning. Last night's dinner.
I told the guys when they came to New York, you'd get a very high caliber of questions. So. I'm glad my hometown is really showing off its true colors. So, yeah, your question.
How many people compliment you on your cough drops?
A lot.
Yeah, your question.
Since you look Jewish, why don't you call yourself? Since you look Jewish, why don't you call yourself a ZZ Dreidel?
We could.
We'll take that under advisement.
I thought they looked Yiddish.
In a pinch, would you wipe?
All right. Well, let's get someone who isn't tongue-tied way back there. I think we're going to break it up now a little more than we have.
One more. Give him a shot.
Definite gluttons for punishment.
Does Sinead O'Connor give you a boner?
Does what give us a boner?
A Sinead O'Connor.
Who is that?
What's a boner?
You guys look at me.
All right, we have a real...
A boner? What is a boner?
Give
us a boner.
Would you shave your beards in protest to Sinead O'Connor?
Is this guy copying my questions or what?
I thought you were together.
No, we're not.
And we're going to adjourn for lunch. And I want to thank the guys for being good sports about this. And thank you.
Shut up. Shut up. Quiet down. Quiet down. I need to calm down. I know what will bring us closer together. I'll smoke my pipe. Little Ricky, oh God, you soiled your diaper. Here, let me take this off and put it over your head. That's better. You need to rest now. Let's make believe we're at the Copa, and the top of your head is a bongo. Babalu, babalu. Oh, the soft spot. God, I love kids. You can't beat them.
Hey, Rick!
Oh, hello, Fred.
Joel! Hey, buddy! I thought I heard Rick playing Babalu, and I said, say, what's this?
Well, gee, I don't know what happened. Little Ricky hasn't moved in 5 minutes.
Well, that figures. He's got Mexican blood in him. It's probably a siesta.
Hey, Fred, want to smoke with me? It'll bring us closer together.
Why not? The kid's napping.
Next time when Ricky says...
Hello, say, why are Joel and Fred naked in the bedroom?
And Lucy says...
Quick, little Ricky isn't moving.
Lucy, this is a disgrace.
What, that little Ricky isn't moving?
No, that my career isn't moving. I'm as stale as the diaper wrapped around little Ricky's head.
On IQ's Little Ricky. A Disney Stern production.
Ha, 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 ha.
Sound I like. Jump right in here.
Well, you know that I am master of the radio world. My show is number one, although I'm hung like a girl. You better keep on listening, so I'll stay on the top. So the zoos and all my clones will be certain to flop. Well, now those guys can eat me. No one can beat me. You got to give me good ratings. Give me good ratings. Give me good ratings every day. Oh, no. Oh, no, I'm not a loser like that lone cousin Bruce or that other dickweed Imus with his drugs and his juice. Muni 65, you know he ain't got a dime. The way Ricky's does radio, I think it's a crime. Well now, those guys all fight it. Why do they fight it? You got to give me huge ratings. Give me huge ratings. Give me huge ratings every day.
Come on, take the break now. Keep drumming and sing at the same time. Here I go.
So keep that dial glued to K-Rock 92.3 and wake up every morning to the brilliance of me. If we get bigger numbers, then our guests will get good. And next time instead of Spencer, we'll get Stevie Winwood with us. Know that I'm a genius with a damn small penis. You gotta give me good ratings. Come on, give me good ratings. Give me good ratings. Give me two of those good ratings every day. Yeah!
Can be heard here in New York City, Philadelphia, and everywhere there are guys who make those kind of noises. Yeah. He also has his own television program. Ladies and gentlemen, here's Howard Stern.
Clock 92.3 K-Rock, WISP, WJFK. Oh, my. Hey, my voice pretty deep today, huh, Robin?
Mm-hmm.
I'm turning you on, huh? Yes. Yeah. Mm. Wow. Who printed out this weather forecast?
Probably Susan.
Does she have a new computer or something? Oh, I see. She blew up the New York Post weather forecast. Wow, that looks professional. She blew it up on a Xerox piece of paper.
Yeah?
Yeah. I'm going to read it. It looks so professional. All right, the weather for today, Tuesday, October 8th. Today, cold early on, and then mostly sunny, highs around 62 for today. Tonight, clear, lows around 48. Tomorrow, sunshine. High clouds. Warmer. High clouds, Robin, tomorrow.
They're going to be high, the clouds.
Yeah. High near 70. Okay, very good. That's the weather
I was going to ask you, is that the end of the warm weather? But 70 sounds pretty good.
Yeah, it's pretty good. It's delightful. there's a lot going on today. There's a whole list of things to get to that we have to talk about. I was moaning and groaning out of bed this morning. I said to my wife, I got to learn to just enjoy my job.
Yeah, you were pretty bummed yesterday.
You'd be too, after those TV meetings. That's like the ninth time I've yelled about organization, and nobody wants to organize the show.
They don't know how.
No, they don't.
They would love to do what you want them to
do.
No. I now see the problem.
Because I heard the problem was after I left the TV meeting and you left, John stood around and yelled at everyone, well, that how come they hadn't done anything? It was I think the point was missed. I don't know. TV show continues to be a hassle.
Well, you know, I wrote note to Fred during, you know, the meeting. You said something about something should be done, boom, right away. You know, now here's what we do. You go and memo, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
And they said, but today is editing day.
Yeah, right. That was it. Then I knew I was doomed.
I wrote a note to Fred.
Yeah.
Everybody in this room edits?
Yeah. They all sit in the room and edit. Well, last night, I had done the editing on Saturday. I called all the shots. So last night, I get a call from John Lolis and Dan. They're both editing. There's nothing to edit. I did it all. It's all done. John should be organizing the TV show.
The problem.
Yeah.
Everybody wants to be...
the star.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wherever the action is, supposedly.
Right. Everyone wants to walk through each step. I can't take it. I can't take it anymore. Everybody wants to be doing the same thing.
Yeah. I mean, everything's a party. You know, they're in lockstep. Nobody can go off in their own project. Nobody can handle anything.
Yeah, everyone's got to, meet over stuff. I said, no more meetings. Just one person do it. You don't need 20 people deciding. We were going to spend all yesterday's TV meeting sitting and picking dates. And I mean, it's just... I'm so tired of that TV show. I got to get out of it because I can't find anybody to head it up the proper way. It's just, I need 19 more. guys to head it up.
No, 19 guys to sit around doing the same thing. It's not going to work.
It just doesn't work. It just doesn't work. Oh, man. Yeah, I was waiting for my stack of memos on my fax machine this morning. I didn't have any.
They were editing.
The only guy who faxed me this morning was Dan O'Day, and he doesn't work in our TV show. Yeah, Dan O'Day, that guy. He's been he wanted me to appear at some conference in California, and I said to him, I'm very honored that you asked me to appear.
Mm-hmm.
I said, Dan, you got to understand something. All I do all week is a radio show, and then I yell at my TV show for all week, and then on Saturdays I work on the TV show. And my wife is, I feel kind of bad. I feel bad turning people down for stuff who've been nice to me, but mm-hmm. I just, Dan O'Day could run our TV show.
He knows how to fax.
Yeah, he can fax.
Yeah.
I get more faxes from him than I do from our TV show.
At least he's faxing.
Dan O'Day. Right, checking in. 11 past 6 o'clock, 92.3 K-Rock, WYSP, WJFK. Robin, so I don't fall behind, I'm going to take a short break here.
Okay.
And then after I take that break, I'm going to line out for you everything that's going to happen. It's going to be, and then I'll memo and fax you. Right after these words.
94 WYSP Stern all morning. Classic rock and roll all day.
Okay, what is this? 1-800-DENTIST? This is just something good. Write this number down. Put it in your phone book. 1-800-DENTIST. When you're looking for a dentist and you don't know who to turn to and you're embarrassed to go interview a bunch of dentists and ask them about their education and their qualifications and their specialties, you call 1-800-DENTIST and they will refer you to a select group of dentists. All right? Person on the phone, the representative on the phone from 1-800-DENTIST can provide you with a full profile on each dentist, their education, how many years in practice, what special training they may have. And with 1-800-DENTIST, you have the security of knowing that thousands of patients are referred to their dentist each month. By the way, looking for dental implants? Who do you turn to for that? These aren't dentures. These are dental implants integrated right into your jaw structure. They look, they feel, they bite like natural teeth. Just call 1-800-DENTIST. They can make a recommendation. Help you make an educated choice. 1-800-DENTIST. Thank you. 616-923-K Rock WYSP WJFK. That's my new vow. I'm keeping the show moving. You notice?
Yes.
Look at me. Look at me. Come on. Come on. Look at me. Look over here.
Well-oiled machine.
Look at me. I was pretty demonstrative. In that meeting yesterday.
Oh, you've become very dramatic.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Is demonstrative the right word? Is demonstrative the right word?
No, I think dramatic.
What does demonstrative mean, Robin?
Well, to demonstrate is basically.
I don't know if that's right. Is that that's almost like, that word?
Animated, I think it's the word.
Yes, maybe
it is?
That's what you're looking for.
Well, what's demonstrative, Fred?
I don't know if it's precise. It's in the ballpark, but it's not precise.
Because remember we all thought histrionics was history?
No, you thought that.
Oh. Histrionics was history until we found out that was just hysterical behavior, isn't it? Histrionics.
Yeah.
Baba Booey.
Oh, here he is, demonstrative. What is it?
Top left hand corner.
Top left hand corner? Demonstrating as real or true, characterized or established by demonstration. Sometimes the dictionary is worse
worthless.
Than...
Yeah. Worthless explanation of the word.
Demonstrative. Demonstrating as real or true. Characterized or established by demonstration. Pointing out the one referred to and distinguishing it from others of the same class. This is why I flunked school. This is why I was bad in high school. I would do the research.
I got it. Demonstrative is like the prototype.
Then it says, a demonstrative word or morpheme.
Morpheme? Then what?
Morphemy. Morpheme than who? I can't believe it. I can't believe I looked a word up. I went to the trouble of looking in the stupid dictionary, and I don't know what it means. That's why school sucks.
No, don't you understand? You didn't understand that explanation.
No. Marked by display of feeling. Inclined to display feelings openly. I hate the dictionary.
Well, I think you could use demonstrative is what you've just said.
Demonstrative means showing what you feel.
Yeah, maybe. Hey, you know what it is? I figured the whole thing out. You have to be smart to get smart. You know what I mean?
Either you know something or you can't know it.
Because I went to school. You know my friend Dr. Lou? He was always getting A's and stuff. But he has a natural aptitude for this stuff.
Yeah.
I look at the dictionary. I don't know what I'm reading.
I heard somebody say the other day, I don't think you can teach anything.
No. I think either you're smart or you're not. You can teach some stuff. Like we learned how to type. That's teaching.
Well, yeah, but we're not great typists. If you've got great skills, you're going to be a great typist, regardless of, you know, whether you learned where to put your fingers.
In other words, if you're stupid, it's very hard to improve. 619-923 K-Rock WYSP WJFK. Coming in this morning at around 6:45 is Hiya Pasha Lee. Gary booked this one.
Who's she?
I approved it. He tells me this is a very famous porno star.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I want to see a famous porno star this morning. I need that.
Mm.
Wonder what she'd do. What's her name? Marilyn Chambers unzipped Larry's fly during commercials.
Yeah, but that was years ago. Is this woman active now?
Hypatia Lee? I don't know. Have you guys ever heard of her? I never heard of her.
I've heard of her. I've never seen her.
Oh, I never heard of her.
What is she, an engine? Hypatia?
That's one of those made-up names. You know.
Is she black?
No.
Is she Oriental?
No.
I thought she was an Indian. Hypatia.
It's not like a real sexy name. It's
no.
Weird name.
She better look good.
Doesn't even sound like a porno name.
Gary says she's like even as big as like Ginger Lynn or someone like that. She's like a really very famous porno star. But I don't know if I believe him.
Out of my realm.
I never heard of her. Maybe she'll just get naked and stuff and run around the studio and threaten to do stuff to us. If I pulled
you away. Haven't had that before.
No. Hiya, Pasha Lee. What's her movie, Dances with Vaginas? Hiya, Pasha Lee. It's a good day to die. 620-923 K-Rock WYSP WJFK. Robin pointed this out to me that in the New York Post, that guy who always gives me a bad review on the TV show, the TV reviewer, because he never had a really deal with us before because we weren't on television.
We were out of his domain.
The TV reviewer guy... Ever since I got that good review, he went on vacation, the guy who always blasts us. And the guy, I think it was Adam Buckman, right? Is that the guy who wrote the good review of us?
I don't remember. You've got it right in there. We should look at his name and remember it.
The guy who wrote the good review of
us.
Yeah. Maybe it was Bill somebody. I have it in here?
No, we have it in the office, don't you?
What, the good review?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah, we should look at
that. It's Adam Buckman, I'm almost positive. He wrote a really good review of the TV show.
You see how you don't remember the ones who write a good
there
review?
There you go.
It's awful.
I'm going to make a point of remembering his name. You're right. We have to remember
his
name.
That's right.
What's the name, Jackie?
Adam Buckman.
Yeah,
you
Adam Buckman.
Correct.
See,
all
I do remember his name.
Adam Buckman.
That really stuck in my mind because he gave us this great 4-star review on our TV show. So now this guy, David Bianaculli, who writes the regular TV column, he used to write, just blast us. Now it seems like he almost has to say something decent about
us. Yeah, he has to save himself.
Yeah, but he doesn't want to come out and quite endorse us. The Howard Stern Show. The second season premiere of The Howard Stern Show has everything that impresses me and disappoints me about Stern. A third of the show is very funny. The opening jab at the other radio guys on TV and Stern's interview with Tony Bennett and his son. That's the funny stuff, I guess.
Okay.
A third is uncomfortably abrasive and unfunny. The dominatrix, for example, and the rest is merely dull. The cruelty of the worst stuff, though, makes it tough to sit through the rest.
And I kept thinking, what was cruel?
Cruel?
I don't know who we were cruel
to. What was cruel about the show?
I don't know. This guy's wearing a crew neck sweater and a man-tailored shirt buttoned up to his neck, you know, the top of his neck.
Yeah.
You know, maybe life seems very hard and cruel to him. I don't know, you know, it just seems like... He looks like a guy things have been hard for.
Mm. So, and everything's cruel.
Yeah, everything's cruel. What is so cruel about the first show? What did we do that was cruel? Tony Bennett was cruel, no. The dominatrix? There's a woman, Donahue doesn't talk to dominatrixes? See, my wife thought it was dull, too, but everyone else I spoke to liked the dominatrix.
Did he say it was dull, the dominatrix?
Well, he said it was abrasive and unfunny. I wasn't really going for
funny. No, that wasn't to laugh at.
I just wanted to see what she would do. Why has everything got to be funny?
You know, they get confused. If you tell them it's a comedy show, then they expect a laugh a minute.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah, that sucks.
Cruel to John, maybe?
cruel to John the Stutterer?
You know what I thought it was? I thought it maybe they thought we were cruel to Todd Bridges.
No, Todd Bridges was acting wacky. And he was into it, though.
I don't understand. But that's the only thing I could think. I said, did he think that was cruel?
Well, I don't know. I don't know. But, you know what it is? It's almost like that's the nicest review we've ever gotten out of him.
Yeah. Thanks he says there's something about you that impresses him.
Yeah.
I didn't know there was anything.
I guess when a TV show goes into its second season, you got to admit to yourself, like, maybe I was a little too harsh, you know? Well. Plus, why are they sending out copies of the first show, the premiere show? I mean, I wasn't that impressed with the premiere show in terms of, like, I think our next show is even better.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm surprised they did that. I mean,
they never discuss that with you.
They don't discuss. You know what?
That's the one decision they can make.
That's the one decision they make on their own.
They don't call you for that one.
No. Well, you know what? Maybe that's better. You know, I'm happy when they don't call me. Because last night they called me, and both guys were in there editing, not doing what I told them to do. They were both editing.
It's amazing.
Yeah, they all want to be a part of that sort of process.
Nobody wants to be the chief.
Right.
Everybody wants to be an Indian.
Well, yeah, everybody wants to sort of, you know, party it up and, like, make up little witty lines.
Well, they got into this business to have a good time, I guess, and they are.
Because I went nuts. Somebody wrote something without my approval on last week's TV show when I was doing a commercial for 1-800-52-STERN. So there was a graphic that said the New York Pest, and then it said 1-800-52-STERN. I went ape during that
what
when I saw it on
New
the playback.
York Pest?
I don't know. It was like a big headline with a banner. Instead of saying New York Post, it said New York Pest. And it said one.
No, I had no idea where that came from.
Me neither. I want to know who wrote that.
Well, you know
who's wasting their time writing that stuff?
I'm pretty sure that was an old. When we did a whole bunch of newspaper.
Yeah,
headlines.
I know, but who put that? Who put that up, Gary? Do you know?
Where was that?
Remember in the 1-800-52-STERN commercial on the TV show?
I think.
Oh yeah.
And it said New York Pest 1-800-52. Whose brilliant idea was that?
I would have to go with one of two people.
Who?
Dan or Kevin?
You think so? No, Dan didn't know where it came from. Dan thought that we had done it, and he was like, "What
maybe
the hell is that?"
Maybe. I think that was one of the Pee Wee.
No, Dan was like, he didn't know where it came from. He said to me, "Why did you guys put that in there?"
They must have had that in Still Store and just thought that was creative.
No. You're too trusting. Somebody was there busy working overtime on stupid stuff.
Oh, you think they created it just for that?
What is it?
This is an article from today's Newsday about Channel 9, but, you know.
Doesn't have anything about us?
Yeah, it does.
Oh, it does.
Your picture and.
Oh, look at that. Out of the Closet Sermon with Todd Bridges.
But look down. I mean, he makes mention of your show, and they talk about how. You know how they help mold you, but check out that
who
bottom.
Wrote this and what's it about?
There's a line right there that's funny.
Clarity of vision. Hey, there's a lot about me.
They describe you very poorly, though.
Oh, they do?
Yeah.
What do they say?
Channel 9 loves nothing as much as weird characters. Judging by the rogues gallery it has assembled to fill three separate studios in the station's Secaucus headquarters tucked between outlet malls and the Meadowlands. Oh, I see. Oh, Bob Woodruff says something different. Clarity of vision and the luxury of independence. He's saying that Channel 9 is, since it's such a swamp out there, it's in the middle of a swamp. Woodruff says it doesn't take a genius to do this kind of programming, but he's saying that because, I think what he's saying is that because you don't have to go through 17 vice presidents, that we can get to be us on the air. What are you looking at, Gary?
Right down at the bottom. Stern's Saturday Night Smut.
Stern's Saturday Night Smut still isn't for everybody, but he's got his devotees. This is from Diane Wirtz. I thought she liked this. Oh, who cares what they have to say? You know what? What are you handing me articles for? In the middle of talking about something. In the middle of talking, I'm sitting here trying to read through and find the parts about me. Underline something, genius. In the middle of the air, I'm supposed to start reading an entire 5-page article on me.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Five pages you got in your hands.
Gary, do you think I should read this whole article on the air? Don't you think it would seem like hours of reading?
Right.
Right. I'm in the middle of talking. How can I read this? Go ahead, leave, because I'm about to explode in you.
Have a party.
Go, I'm in the middle of, like, doing
Baba
something.
Booey.
How the hell can I read a whole article, Robin?
I want it right away. It's a point. There it is.
I want it right away during a commercial so I can read. I mean.
Well, I don't know why. You can't get your staff under control.
I tell you something. I mean, I'm sitting here reading. I'm trying to explain an article I haven't read yet. quickly, here's an article, boss. There's a whole big article on you on Newsday. And but, I mean, I can't read a whole friggin' article right on the air.
You can't get the gist of this in about 5 seconds.
Yeah, I mean, this guy's making me go nowhere. How many years has Gary been here?
Seven, I think.
Gary, why don't you go edit the TV show? You're on the air. There were two guys.
Hello, Howard. I'll get right to the point.
I'm in a TV. This is, understand something. Understand why I'm such a nut. Why I have to get out of this business. I'm sitting in my house last night thinking about how they're busy organizing my TV show, and it's two guys sitting and doing the same thing that I've already done.
Uh-huh.
It drives me crazy.
You talking about those two imbeciles in L.A.?
No.
No, no, no. By the way, I heard a pretty good story out of L.A.
What was that?
You want to hear a story?
Yeah, sure.
Andy Blum called Gary last night and told him this. If it's even a half true, it's really great.
What is it?
So, Mark and Brian, two imbeciles we compete with in Los Angeles. The two guys who hug each other in every press photo you've ever seen of them.
Those two idiots.
Well, yeah. Two idiots go to a... They decide for their... I guess they're still taping their TV show. I guess they don't see the writing on the wall.
Well, I guess they're doing this for their own pleasure.
Right.
You know, they'll have it on home video.
Hey, we can show our kids at least that we had a TV show. Because they got to have a kid together, I'm sure. Why don't they just marry each other and have kids together?
Oh, darn it. One of them went and married a woman.
That could be their next stunt. They get married to one another and they adopt a few children.
Yeah.
There you go. But anyway, or insert turkey basters into each other and try to impregnate one another. So, thank you. Anyway, so...
Was that like a token or what?
No, I think he was laughing.
Sounded good.
Yeah, sounded good. The guy laughed.
All right.
Their next stunt should be they build a bathhouse together, and they invite a bunch of guys in so they won't look so conspicuous when they're hugging each other on camera. Okay, so...
Well, Howard, I'll get right to the point here.
Oh, wait a minute. Howard was making a point.
I'm trying to tell you a story, unless you're in a rush.
No. I want to hear it. Go ahead.
If I don't get this out, I'll never remember it.
All right.
Okay. So Mark and Brian go to this baseball game. They're evidently taping a segment of their TV show, or their the whole TV show is that they're going to be the play-by-play guys for one of the football games or one if something. I don't know what the hell was going on.
Yeah.
Baseball game, something like that.
Yeah.
They're going to be play-by-play for one set, one inning.
Right.
So,
boy, that's risky.
Yeah, all right. So they
there's an element of danger there.
Yeah, we really want to see that. Yeah, that's a pretty tough stunt. They don't know what to do. They saw that jumping out of a plane people weren't interested in, so now they're going with a different approach.
Yeah, because they use parachutes. People want to see them jump without the parachute.
A half hour of preparing, learning the names of the players. And
that is the most boring crap.
All right, but get past that.
Okay.
So they're in this stadium, and they put them up on, like, Diamond Vision on the big screen.
Mm-hmm.
They put their two faces up there. The whole stadium stands up and starts booing, and everyone started, not everyone, but Andy said pockets of people started screaming out Howard.
Well.
I mean, that's got to drive them nuts. If that really happened, that's got to make them crazy.
All I know is that sometimes Andy exaggerates.
Right.
So yeah, I don't know how much of this to believe.
Want
to
call Andy and see if it's really real?
Yeah, maybe we better get it from the horse's mouth, as they say.
Hey, Gary, why don't you see... Speaking of horse's mouth, why don't you see if you can get Andy on the phone? You know what it was? Probably Andy was driving up by the baseball stadium and saw, like, the KLOS van and started yelling from his car. You know, like, Howard.
He heard somebody yelling Howard, only it was him.
Yeah.
Howard?
Yeah.
I got something for you here. I'm a brainwashed disciple of a religious cult.
Yeah.
It might interest you to know what religious cult I'm a member of.
You wouldn't be brainwashed if you were calling me and saying you were brainwashed. You know what I'm saying?
No.
Are you saying that you were deprogrammed?
Mm-mm.
Then you're saying you're still in the cult.
I'm a disciple of the Reverend Sun Yung Stern.
Did you write that yourself? I said, hey, what an interesting caller. This guy's in a cult, you know, and it'd be kind of cool to talk to him. And then it had to be, I'm a disciple of Sun Yung Stern, which is something, you know.
The Reverend Sun Yung Stern.
All right, yeah. Let's continue with this. Oh, really?
Okay.
I thought you were a disciple of Reverend Way Too Dumb.
No. No, you're the god of radio, and the devil is Imus.
Okay. Hey, thanks, man. That was worth waiting for. Thank you.
And yeah, I'm glad you got right to the point so we didn't have to waste any time.
Yeah, you didn't beat around the bush too much. Thank you.
I self...
Okay, good. What a retard. Go edit my TV show.
They need help.
They need help. We all have to waste time. All right, here's Andy. Andy. Andy?
Howard.
You're on the air.
Good morning.
All right, so what are you saying?
Okay, so there's two different people who tell me this story.
Right, so you weren't there, but...
No, I wasn't there.
But so these are reliable sources.
Yeah, two completely reliable sources.
All right, so, okay, the Mark and Brian show goes, the TV show, which they're still taping, which is amazing to me.
Right, they're going to do another couple episodes.
Right.
And they're taping an episode, and the idea is that they're going to be...
sports announcers.
Sports announcers, right. So they,
for a baseball game?
For a football game.
All right, football game.
For the Raiders-Chargers game last Sunday.
Okay.
So they actually go on and, you know, they become the color commentator.
Okay.
And at some point, they put them up on the Fanavision. And
right.
They introduce them as KLOS Mark and Brian.
Right.
And at that point, it was significant, so two different people sitting in two different parts of the stadium could hear the boos and people yelling, Howard.
Hmm.
Was I thought it? That was pretty cool. It's kind of the start of it.
All right, so that's, that confirms, you know, maybe Andy's not delusional this time. He's not saying the whole stadium, but...
All right.
No, I mean, loud enough for two different people sitting in two completely different parts of the stadium.
So at least you didn't start it, you know. I mean, it wasn't like you driving
no,
by a
I
car.
No, I wasn't
and,
there. I would have loved to have heard it.
All right. Okay, we wanted to double-check that. That's all.
All right. All right. I'll go back to sleep now.
All right, goodbye.
Okay, goodbye.
Andy Blum. That's the kind of calls I get usually at my house, but Gary gets them now.
Good.
I told Andy not to call me with stories anymore. They get me too nuts. Because, you know, then you get, you know, you hear all these stories and you look at the rating. It's a 1.8. You know, it's like...
I know. There's a big letdown.
Yeah, right. I'd rather not hear those stories and just see big ratings. 635-923-KROQ, WYSP, WJFK. I'm reading Billboard, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they're talking about, you know, in Los Angeles, Howard Stern was flat. You know, that's fine. We were on for 6 weeks. You know, give me a break.
So you were flat.
Yeah, we were flat. But then the guy goes... This seems to be the trend. This isn't Billboard. This is what our whole industry reads. This, after a great ratings books in every market we're in, guy goes, well, that seems to be the trend in all his other markets, except for New York, where he had a 7. So I fired off a letter to the guy. I got so, you know me, I don't write.
Yeah.
Actually, I didn't fire the letter off. I typed it, and I never mailed it.
Oh, jeez.
Because I said, you don't
all of his correspondence
it.
Is still in the computer.
Yeah, it is. But it's good cards. I just basically said, you know, if you don't know what you're talking about, why don't you keep your trap shut? And if you feel like talking about something, why don't you list an apology here? We had a 7 in New York. We got the number one show in New York. In Philly, we got the number one show. We're up to an 8.9. We trounced the competition. In Washington, we more than doubled what we had in the morning there on a suburban station. And you're telling me I'm flat everywhere? That's what you're. That's the compliment I get in Billboard magazine. Thank you, you dickhead. I went out of my mind. I can't read these papers. I said, what do you mean I'm flat? Scott Shannon, years ago, they're giving him awards. They don't know what to do for him because he had a 6. I don't see any articles on him anymore.
Now, there's a guy who's flat.
Yeah. Talk about flat. I mean, where am I? You mean I'm flat because I'm on top? I mean, how much higher are you going to go? I mean, I got to go up every ratings book. And I did. And the guy writes, he's flat in every market. What a dick. See, that's the kind of stuff that gets me nuts.
Mm.
You finally do something good, and then all the people in our industry can read it, and then maybe some other markets would be interested in taking us. But they read it, and they go, oh, he was flat everywhere else. Forget
that's
it.
That's not working.
Yeah, it's not working. Stern's not working out. That's great. I might as well do bad. Because they write that I'm doing bad anyway. Bunch of rat bastards.
Maybe they think, oh, he'll break out. And then we won't have any control of him at all.
Gary, why don't you look up in Billboard the guy who writes the Vox Jocks column in Billboard. All right, look that up. Do me a favor. And then call him and ask him to explain to me on the air why I'm flat. Why he listed I was flat. Here's a guy. I'm not going to pick on him. Just explain to me where I'm flat. You know, you got a bunch of schmegma-licking fudge cadets who all are busy with God knows what. They're not judging the facts.
We don't know what these people do in their off hours.
Well, neither do I. I just say I'm like... No, I'm just saying, in general, there's a bunch of schmegma-looking fudge cadets out there in the world. Not him.
Okay,
not him. I'm not saying
him.
No. I'm just saying they're all. There's a lot of them out there, out to get you. In general, schmegma-looking fudge cadets are out there. Right, Freddy?
You said it.
Right. Okay. I don't mean specifically anyone.
Okay,
I'm
just
saying,
I just wanted to make sure.
No, you understand what I'm saying.
You weren't being specific.
No, of course not. But thank you for clarifying. All right, 6:39, we'll be back right after these words.
All visitor and all morning. Classic rock and roll all day.
The advertising, hold it a second. I can just picture the advertising session. We want a theme song that's catchy, but we want the lyrics to include 1-800-321-THIN. And it's like, that's a pretty tall order in a song. Can't the voiceover guy say it? No, we want it in the jingle. All right, Fred. You sing it, Robin. I don't want to ruin it.
Come on, you sing it with me.
No, I don't feel like it.
Come on and neutralize your... What am I here? Nutricize your mind. All you have to do is make a phone call. This is the wrong part of the song. It's 1-800-321-THIN.
Man, I could never sing this song. It's too difficult.
I'd have to start at the beginning.
All right, go ahead. Wait.
That's the end of the song.
All right, Nutrisystem. So if you want to, lose all the weight you can for the price of a 10-pound program. Food and evaluation fee not included at participating centers only. Call 1-800-321-THIN.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, honey.
Mm-hmm.
Visit our new center on Route 202. Visit their newest center, not our. Got to get the copy straight on this radio station. Is there a traffic department here? I don't own Nutrisystem.
We wish we did.
If I say visit our newest center, it sounds like I own it. Yeah, we wish we did, but we don't. Visit their newest center on Route 202/31, just south of the Circle in Flemington, New Jersey. Gary, make sure that copy's changed. Imagine you could take your size 38 pants and...
throw them away.
Get them down to a nice neutral size 32. That'd be nice.
They don't reduce your clothes, Howard.
Well, no, but you know your waist size. But you know something? The food is so good, that's the secret. The food tastes good, and you're never hungry on it. Go give Robin the song so she can do that part. It's right in the beginning.
Come on and nutricize your body.
I don't think it's there.
I don't think it's easy either.
Oh, for hell with it.
Nutricize. That's the right music.
I'm in no mood to hear it anyway. 1-800-321-THIN.
Come, if you sing it with me, we can sing it together.
I got that tape of that song about me by the Two Live Crew.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Can we play it?
Yeah, but first we got to meet the porno star.
Oh, she's here already.
A lot of guys called Gary in the back and said that she is a porno legend.
A legend.
So here's some of her movies off the watch these.
The one you're holding in your right hand is the one she won Best Actress for.
Best Actress from where?
From
the Porno Awards?
I guess so, yeah.
The Masseuse, She'll Rub You Right. A totally different story for Vivid and Paul Thomas. Involving the dilemma of Randy Spears, who seems to have fallen madly in love with his masseuse, one Hyapatia Lee. Along with the idea that this is reality, not a massage parlor, AVN says, I don't even know what the hell this is.
Do you know what AVN is?
What?
AVN is Adult Video News, which is that guy that used to do a porn report.
All I know is if you know AVN... what that means. I think you're a little too into porn.
No, we used to do it on the air. Come on, man.
No, I'm not you. I'm saying in general. The back of a box is AVN says AVN.
And there's no other reference
to
it.
No. Well, she's got some hot little body. But Gary just ruined it for me.
Why?
He said her husband's here. He's the manager out there. And that he could hear like he has a baby in the background when he called her on the phone.
Well,
you know.
These people have real lives.
Yeah, well, please. I'd prefer not to think about their real lives. See, that ruins it now. And our husband's there. I want them to get naked and be wild. And then she's going to come in and try and act like a legitimate businesswoman.
Well, let's see. How do you know?
All right. Why don't you bring her in here already?
Okay.
All right. We'll interview a little bit. We'll do some interviewing, some preambling.
You know, I'm sure Marilyn Chambers was married when she was fooling around with Larry King.
I doubt it.
You don't think so?
No. I believe that she wouldn't do that. She's got a hell of a body on this box, but I got to see her up close. You know, anybody in a box, because can't they airbrush?
Yeah, they can take things away.
Because I really have nothing to ask these porno stars. I like to just see them naked.
We don't even know her movies.
Hi, Hyapatia.
Hi there.
Are you an Indian?
Yes, I am.
Oh, see, she is an Indian.
I'll see you at Dohitsu.
You're an American Indian?
Yeah, I am. Part Cherokee, part Irish.
Well, at least you're not on the reservation drinking. At least you're making something out of your life.
Oh, thank you.
I'll tell you that.
Thank you.
Did you see that? Did you grow up on a reservation?
No, actually, I didn't. I grew up in Indianapolis, Indiana. My great-grandmother was from the Western Band of the Cherokees in the reservation in Oklahoma, so I heard a little bit about it, but never experienced it.
I was thinking of going into porno. I'm a very large man. I wanted to show that off.
I heard that.
Yes. In fact, when I make love to my wife, I have to wear a ring.
Oh, really?
Yes, I do.
What's the ring for?
So that I don't hurt her. That's how big I am. I have to wear a ring.
Ever use some of those extra-large condoms?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. I need those. I used to have to... Wow, you're taking your pants off?
Yeah, it's kind of hot in here.
Whoa, all right. I thought this was going to be ruined because your husband was here.
I heard you say that.
Yeah, I was a little bummed out.
No, we have an open marriage.
So,
What does an open marriage mean?
It means you can have fun, you can do whatever you want to, you know, as long as there's no jealousies involved. So you do everything in front of each other. Or
see, I just got aroused.
Knows what's going
I just
on.
Got aroused. Why are you taking your shirt off?
Yeah.
Wow.
Is
it
okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. I knew this would be good.
It's a free country.
It sure
there
is.
There you go. I was born naked.
I can't stop you from doing. Wow. What a body on you. Well,
ooh,
childbirth hasn't ruined your figure.
She's sweet.
Wow. You're not wearing underpants, are you?
Nope.
Now you're totally nude.
Yeah. I don't even have my shoes on.
You're kidding.
Nope. But you're never fully dressed without a smile. So
can you stand
smile.
Up so I can see you? Wow. Wow. Totally naked. You enjoy doing interviews nude.
Yeah, I do. I'm a nudist, and I believe in the freedom of, you know, to express yourself. I'd much rather be nude and have sex.
Well, jump out of your clothes, Howard. I don't want to inhibit you.
Yeah, I like to be naked, too.
Yeah, join me.
Except
now
with Fred and Jackie here. See, this is how it should be. No begging.
No begging?
Yeah, she just took her clothes off. I didn't have to say, please take your clothes off or anything like that.
It's fun.
And you love having sex on camera, huh?
Absolutely.
With lots of different guys.
Yeah.
And you do a lot of lesbian stuff?
I do some. I prefer men.
You do?
Yeah.
But let me ask you something. In this open relationship, so in other words, if you see a guy that you like, you can just go be with him?
Well, generally what we do is we'll have like a little get together and have a foursome. But he'll find a girl that he likes.
Uh-huh.
What's his name?
Uh-huh.
We'll
hope my wife's listening.
In front of each other.
And you're very happy. How long have you been married?
Oh, well, it'll be 9 years on the 11th of this month.
Hey, do me a
favor. It's working.
Go kiss Robin.
No. Yeah.
Hey, Robin, come over and make out with her.
No.
Come on, let's see that.
I'm not into that.
I like to see that.
Not that you aren't very attractive.
No, I understand.
All right. She doesn't go that way. No kidding, huh? And you bring home other girls for your husband, huh?
Yeah, I try.
Oh, man, you're excellent.
That's like 2 weeks in a row.
I know.
We've met women like that.
Sam Kinison's girlfriend.
Oh, cool.
Does that for him, too.
Very good.
Brings home girls, but no other guys.
No, she doesn't like, they don't like other guys in the scene.
So you don't even have to be attracted to a guy to have sex with him?
Oh, yes, I do.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
But you find yourself attracted to a lot of guys.
That's true. I like to get to know a person better because
really?
I find many times that just looking at a person doesn't do anything. I mean, you can find somebody very attractive physically and they can be a jerk, you know, between the ears.
Tell me about it.
On the other way around, you can find somebody that, you know, you wouldn't really look at and pick out on the street, but you can find they're a very nice guy and very good to find.
And you prefer a huge totem pole, don't you?
No, not necessarily.
No,
it's not how long your oar is. It's how you row the boat. Just keep stroking.
Really?
You.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, remember that, Howard.
Yeah, because I don't wear no ring.
I was hoping you'd show me, really.
Really?
Yeah.
Hmm.
Well, you are a nudist, Howard.
Yeah. I'm hung like a squaw, though. I'm too embarrassed. Let me tell you something. If I was hung like a real man, I would show you in 2 seconds. But I'm embarrassed.
Well, you know, women are bad judge of measurements anyway. We've always been told that, like, about this is 6 inches.
Right.
So.
Right.
That's you might have a foot and a half for all I know.
I don't let my wife watch porno movies because, quite frankly, I have convinced her that I'm large.
Yeah.
And if I was to show her these movies, she would know right away that I was lying. She knows I'm lying.
Even if you take 6 inches and do a real close-up on it on the screen.
I can't believe how naked you are.
Nice.
You are so naked. And what a body.
Thank you.
What, do you see cups?
Yep.
And those are natural, aren't they?
Mm-hmm.
Those aren't breast implants.
Well, I've had a little help.
You have had a little help.
I have to be honest.
But they look totally natural. Those do look natural, Robin.
Well, they do. Yeah, they're not like the ones that we see in here sometimes.
I can't believe how naked you are. Wow. That's so great.
You totally shaven?
Nope. I still have my fur.
All right. Now, I understand you will be dancing at Goldfinger's in Queens tonight through Saturday.
That's right.
What, do you just get up on stage and dance around and stuff?
Well, one of the things I'm most infamous for is a fire show. I set myself on fire.
Really? Like Vinnie Mazzio?
Yeah, we have a friend who does that.
Yeah,
oh, really?
Yes, he lights his head. And he lights his private parts
on
fire.
Yeah, but usually we have
that
to.
I burn my breast out.
Yeah. You burn your breast?
Yeah. Well, it's a special chemical type thing, you know.
And does your guy get to come up on stage and put it out, or you do it yourself?
No, I do it myself.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, it generally goes out by itself.
See, a lot of you porno girls, though, project this kind of image, but you really don't like to have sex with a lot of different guys. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's exactly right. It's, you know, it's an act. We're actresses. You know, part of it is true, but we always have to animate it for screen, you know, make it a little bigger than life.
I see.
Not to say that we don't have fun in our true lives, but sometimes with all the traveling and doing the personal appearances and the movies for Vivid Video and things like that,
but this is really what you wanted to do? This is your dream in life.
Yeah.
Is it still fun? That's what
Yes, it is. I wouldn't be doing it if it wasn't.
And your parents see this stuff?
My mother's a big fan of Nina Hartley's. She hasn't seen any of my movies. I'm kind of embarrassed to show her.
You're embarrassed to show her your... And your father has seen you having sex on screen?
No, my father's not as into it at all.
My parents
are divorced, needless to say.
Oh, they are.
Yeah.
But your father probably is down on it. He probably thinks it's kind of slutty, right?
Yeah, he kind of does, actually.
So is he talking to you?
He's more of a religious Southern Baptist. Oh, yeah, he talks to me. He says, as long as I'm happy, you know, then it can't be all that bad, but it's not something he would have chosen for his daughter to do and not something he personally enjoys watching.
Well, that's
my grandmother makes my G-strings, though, for my dancing costume.
She does. Your grandmother makes all the G-strings.
Yeah, she does. Well, she makes
Granny's a wild woman.
So what age did you start doing this? What age were you when you first started being in porno movies and being naked and having sex with guys on screen?
19. Yeah.
Now, but wait a minute. When did you discover that you really love sex?
I don't know if she loves sex.
That's a good question. At around the age of 16, I noticed that I was having a lot more extracurricular activities than some of my other girlfriends.
Uh-huh.
And I had this little thing, this little game I used to challenge myself with, to find somebody who was older, whoever was older, the oldest I could get, because I figured they were more experienced and I'd learn more from them.
Right.
So by realizing that I was a little different from my peers and wanting more sex and trying to learn more about it than they were, I guess I noticed a difference.
You ever been hit on by major celebrities?
No, I can't really say I have. Not that I wouldn't, be interested if anybody's listening.
Really? You would have sex with major celebrities?
There are many that I have crushes on, I have to admit.
Well, who would you be interested in?
Oh, Bono from U2, especially.
Yeah. Well, we could arrange that. We know him, don't we, Robin?
Oh, sure.
Robin, you've had sex with him, haven't you?
Every day.
Yeah. What about Fred Norris? Are you attracted to him at all?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Whoever he is.
Sure.
Yeah, you find me attractive, huh?
Yes, I do.
You do?
Yes.
Oh, you're just lying.
No, I'm serious. I follow your career.
Never...
I listen to you in L.A.
Really?
Yeah.
How come you never ran across a woman like this who was, like, sexually experimenting?
Because, you see, I could have used someone like this, but believe me, she wouldn't have been interested in me unless I was on the radio.
Really?
Believe me.
Even a woman who loves sex.
I don't know.
Even a woman who loves sex. None of the women I ever met love sex. It was never that enjoyable for them.
So you have to learn to make it enjoyable for them.
You're willing to put out. My wife, everything is like, oh, I don't like that. Oh, I would do that, but my knees hurt.
You have to get her some more movies.
I've got condomalacia of the knee. I mean,
is what you're listening to in bed?
Right. I started getting romantic Friday night, and she goes, well, my period is until tomorrow. And I go, she does it. She sabotages it.
Get her a good X-rated movie.
She doesn't like that. She watches that and she doesn't like that.
Oh, that's too bad.
I don't think she likes it, that stupid vibrator I got to use on her. I resent that. Every time, it's get the vibrator. Should I get the vibrator?
Those things are nice, though.
Yeah, they're nice, but, you know, you'd think that maybe I'd still turn her on once. We've been married for like 19 years already.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I guess this is what we have to look forward to.
Well, I don't think your marriage is going to get boring.
Let me say, your marriage is never going to get boring. Not the way you guys are carrying on.
Well, we'll keep trying not to.
See, but I'm the cleanest guy in New York. Meanwhile, you have to worry about AIDS with all the guys you sleep with.
That's true. We're doing a lot of things to prevent AIDS and protect ourselves.
Are you working on a cure?
No, I'd like to be doing
that. Forget about it.
Well, we're using condoms now in movies, every movie I do.
You are using condoms?
Yeah.
Do you show the condom?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
For some reason, guys don't like to see that.
I know.
I don't know, though. You guys do a lot of stuff, though, without the condoms.
A lot of times in the past we have. It's changing right now. Yeah, we use spermicidal lubricants to Nonoxynol 9, which has been known to inhibit the AIDS virus in laboratory tests. Mm-hmm. And also we do take AIDS tests and work with people who...
All right. I'll take that off the air.
Oh, boy.
You're a little too wild.
I am patiently sorry about that.
I don't care. You know what? I don't care what she says, as long as she sits there naked.
Yeah, you're sitting there gazing at her breast. I'm like, hello?
I'm digging it. I'm just digging it. Cool. Hey, let's do something. What do you want to do?
Well, I don't know. I heard you're kind of kinky, though.
Yeah. What do you want to do?
I don't know. Why don't you tell me?
Want to, want to stay all day?
I don't know if Goldfingers would like that, but that'd be kind of tempting, though. Yeah.
You want to, you're up for anything, huh?
Well, I'm always interested in hearing it.
Really?
Yeah.
What can I do?
Nothing. Practically nothing.
I am.
You're a married man.
Want to talk to my wife?
Sure.
Want to play Judge Thomas and his secretary?
I like that. I love that. I do. Yeah,
you like playing secretary?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I can be the head potentate and then give her some sexual discrimination.
There you go. You can sexually harass her. Yeah.
Want to go for some spanking?
That's what I heard, that you're pretty
into that.
No, actually, I'm not. Mm. But if you want to come over here, I'd be happy to spank you.
Really? You would spank me?
Sure. Hmm. I mean, if you're into it. I try to make people happy.
Want to do something to your husband with me watching?
Well, that'd be interesting.
Yeah.
I don't know if he'd go for that. He's kind of shy.
Yeah, well, forget it. I don't know.
He's not the performer in the film.
Yeah, I don't want to see him.
You wouldn't like to see who's married to her with this open marriage and... having all this fun, her bringing home new
women.
He's
full of it. He lets her bring home women, but he doesn't let her bring home any guys.
Oh, I bet you she gets new guys. I haven't brought home many women at all.
Really? You keep bringing home guys?
Yeah.
And you bring home guys, and you and your husband get in bed with this guy?
Mm-hmm.
Really? And he doesn't mind that?
No. What's that?
Oh, man.
Now, sometimes he'll bring home
That would be my luck.
Oh, you have the... Yeah.
Oh, he'll bring home a woman, and then you have to have a three-way thing going with her.
Yeah, I wouldn't say have to.
Yeah, but I mean,
it's fun.
Wow. Oh.
Can you imagine that?
Can I imagine it? No, I can't.
Makes for a happy family. Make love, not war, you know?
Do you mind being naked during the commercials?
Not at all.
Really?
Now, where do they put the kids when this is going on?
Yeah.
Well, we have a babysitter that travels with us, kind of like a glorified nanny or something.
They put the kids in a separate house while this is going on.
Well, you know, the Indians used to actually make love in front of their children. I mean, not explicitly, but with the teepees and all that. Yeah.
That's why they're all drunken on the reservation. You know what I'm talking about.
I don't know. I think it has something to do with the Wasichus.
You make big money?
Is the IRS listening? I don't know. It depends on what's big, you know. I'm happy.
Really? A couple hundred grand?
Nah, it depends on how hard I want to work. I wouldn't say it's...
You've had every ethnic group? You ever had black guys?
Mm-hmm.
How are they? Better?
It depends on the individual.
Had Spanish?
You know? Yeah.
Polish?
I can't remember anybody Polish.
Ever have a Chinese?
No, I haven't, but it's one of my fantasies.
Really? Have a Chinese?
Indian?
Oriental. I mean, like Indian.
Eastern Indian, yeah. I've done
that. You had that, huh?
Yeah.
Had two black guys at the same time?
No, I've never done that.
See? You haven't done it all.
That's right. Oh, I know.
All right, we'll take a break.
There's still roads to conquer.
That's right. It's not time to die yet.
Ever have an amputee?
No.
Midget?
No. See, there's a lot of things I haven't done. I'm a virgin, practically. There you go. See?
Hyapatia Lee is appearing at Goldfingers in Queens tonight through Saturday. You can go see her dance. She's totally naked here. Wouldn't that disappoint you to see her nude? That's awfully nice of you just to sit there naked like that.
Well, thanks. It's nice to have me on.
All right. We'll be back right after this.
The 90th Classic Rock and Roll All Day.
A lot of things I haven't even done yet. I got married when I was 24.
Really?
And I was dating my wife for 4 years before that. So when I was 20, I stopped having sex with anybody else. I haven't had sex with another person. How many years is that?
Since you were 19.
Since I was 20.
Since you were 20. That's 17 years.
17 years I haven't had sex with anybody but my wife.
But you said you were married 19. I knew that number was getting awfully high.
No, I met my wife when I was 20.
Yes.
And... But, I, you know, since I met her, I've only had sex with her.
Yeah, but you keep saying 19. It's 17.
What's 17?
The years you've been together.
That's 17 years?
Yes.
Oh, I see. I didn't know what you meant. I thought you meant 19 I married her or something.
No.
17, 19, does it make a difference? You're talking about 17 years I've been with the same woman.
That's great. It's very commendable.
And it's not like she goes out of her way to make it interesting. I mean, it's like it's the same thing all the time.
You guys don't change a thing.
Everything's the same. In the bed.
It's working for you.
On her back.
It's working for you.
Missionary position. That's my favorite position.
That's my favorite, too.
Yes.
You can look your partner in the eyes.
Right.
While you're doing
it. Very romantic.
Yeah.
How tall are you?
5'5".
It's perfect. Anyway, let me tell you about PF Flyers. I like the original PF Flyer. I always thought it was a great looking sneaker, but they stopped making them. Now they're making them.
Yeah, they disappeared.
PF Flyers. They're a happening shoe. Not like those big, bulky, hideous sneakers that make you look like you're from another planet.
Yeah, those things you have to pump.
You wear your PF Flyers, right?
Of course.
That's why you're meeting so many guys. Because they see your PF Flyers. It's a conversation
piece.
That's
right. That's why I wear them.
In Midtown Manhattan, where can you get PF Flyers? Okay, Midtown Manhattan, athletic style. Uptown at Men's Walkers. In Brooklyn, A to Z Sportswear. On Long Island, it's Nemo's Army and Navy. In Oceanside, Hewlett and Roslyn. Chargers Sports in Center Mariches. Sportstown in Huntington. Sports Bug in Stony Brook. Plaza Surf and Sporting Goods, Rocky Point. In Nutley, New Jersey, it's Killer Bee Sporting Goods. And in Princeton, New Jersey, it's Hewlett's. And if you can't find them at a store near you, just ask for them. And they can get in touch with the PF Flyers company. It's the original PF Flyer. They haven't changed a thing about it. We're sitting here for a couple more minutes with Hyapatia Lee, who is appearing at Goldfinger's in Queens tonight through Saturday. She's a porno star. I didn't know you as a porno star, but I don't know the names of a lot of porno stars.
Have you ever seen one of her movies, though?
No, but I got two of them here, so I'm going to watch them.
What are the names of them?
One is...
I know one of
the Enchantress. Enchantress and the Masseuse.
The Masseuse.
She'll rub you right.
Yeah, both by Vivid Video.
And I dig that G-string thing you're wearing. She's wearing like underpants, but they're like G-string underpants, right?
Yep.
Is that what that is?
Yep.
Wow.
T-bag, we call it.
You make it with any girls in this one?
No, not that one.
What about this one?
Yes, that one I do.
In The Enchantress.
Yeah.
Wow.
I have a great scene with a lady by the name of Portia Lynn, a beautiful tall blonde.
How many times, how many guys have you gotten on with at once?
Generally just one or two. I like to concentrate on one guy and do a lot of things with that one person.
Right.
You know, rather than spread myself out.
That's your philosophy, isn't it, Robin?
Yes, absolutely.
Wow.
One at a time, please.
Wow. It's perfect. Just the way you sit there naked and you don't care and it's just great.
I was born this way.
Yeah.
No, you weren't. You didn't look anything like
that. Well, I didn't have myself done.
And you like all aspects of sex, huh? Even stuff that doesn't make babies.
Well, yeah.
You do
it
like that.
It depends on what we're talking about.
Oh,
yeah.
I know. You know what I'm talking about.
I don't like real kinky things.
Well, no,
like,
nothing kinky here. I don't even know what you're talking about. You have to be a pervert, honey.
I just heard stories about you.
Oh, what did you hear? Yeah.
Well, my friend Ginger told me you were a lot of fun.
She did?
Yeah. You're into spanking and things like that.
Well, that's because that's the only thing my wife will let me do.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I mean, what else could I do?
Well, if you were her husband, her husband.
I could think of a list of things.
You could do a lot of things.
No, my wife doesn't look at things that way. My wife figures, hey, when she met me, there weren't all that many women coming on to me. So now all of a sudden. Let's keep it that way, like how we met. What can we do that my wife wouldn't be upset about?
Well, I don't know your wife, so that'd be.
Well, you know what I'm saying. Can't have sex.
That's out.
That's out. You ever have sex with disc jockeys when you go and visit them and stuff?
I've gotten close a couple times.
Really?
Yeah, there's this guy, Sebastian, and I think it was East Hartford, Connecticut, that got really wild.
What did he do?
He got a vibrator out.
Oh, really?
Chased me around the room with the vibrator.
Oh, boy.
I wanted the real thing. He wouldn't
do it.
Yeah. He took his clothes off and then he put them right back on. It was like a tease, you know. It's frustrating.
Really?
Yeah.
And he was a good-looking guy?
Yeah, he was all right.
He was all right.
Yeah.
Disc jockey.
Disgusting. Where's my vibrator? I'll chase you around the room.
There you go. Okay.
So he brought out a vibrator?
Yep, he sure did.
And you used it?
No, he chased me around with it. I wasn't interested in his vibrator. I didn't know where he'd put it.
So he chased you around with it, and that was the end of it?
Yeah. Because he wouldn't do it with the... I mean, he put his clothes back on, and it was... You know.
I don't know what to do. You know, my wife's got me so confused. I don't know what I'm allowed to do.
What has she told you now?
She told me she don't like even spankings and stuff.
Oh, really? The spankings are out.
Where's that baseball bat we have?
Oh, stop. Goodness, you took that home.
Yeah, I took that home. That big baseball bat.
Oh, my.
I don't know if there's much I can do with it that would really get people excited.
Yeah, to come into Goldfinger's and we'll take a real intimate picture together. I didn't.
I think I've seen pretty much everything. I don't know that there's much for me to go to Goldfinger's for. I've seen you do it all.
Well, I haven't seen me set myself on fire.
Yeah, right. No, that's true. You can't do that, huh? Can't do that
not now. Right now. I don't have all the right chemicals. But, mm. Yeah.
I'd spank you, but you don't go for that. I could. Yeah, you'd spank me.
Okay.
I don't know. You don't seem that into that. Something like you'd just be doing to help me out because I'm so miserable.
That's true. Well, I wouldn't say you're miserable, but...
Believe me, you don't know me that well. I don't know, Robin. Anything else?
I can't think of a thing.
Fred?
I thought you'd gone way too far in the first place.
You do. Just for taking her clothes off.
You try that thing that Jackie did once. Was
what's
having
that?
His toes sucked.
Toe sucked?
Oh,
no, I don't want
no.
that. I don't know. That's something disgusting.
Oh.
I'd have to go wash my feet first.
Yeah.
And just imagine, Jackie had his malignant toes sucked.
Hey, yeah, Jackie. I heard about that yesterday at the meeting. I got to bring that up on the air.
Those hookers must have killed
Jackie, can I just say something? Hiya, Patricia. Excuse me for 1 minute.
You could wait till she left for this.
Hiya, Patricia's not your real name, though, is it?
Hiya, Patricia. I'm Enigma Nam, Mishawak of Grayville.
Oh, it really is. Mm. Good for you. Gosh. All right.
Sorry.
So, we're in a TV meeting yesterday. If you don't mind sitting here naked through this.
That's all right. Sounds interesting. You got my curiosity up.
Okay.
There.
And then maybe while I'm sitting here, I can think of something to do with you. It just seems like kind of a waste to have a porno star here and not do anything with her. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Let her rub your feet.
What is that? What do you mean, rub my feet?
What's something?
That's disgusting. She's not going to like that.
Dirty feet?
Yeah, my dirty, smelly feet.
I could go sit on your lap.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I don't know.
What was that?
I don't know. It might lead to other things.
There you go.
All right, come over here. Sit on my lap. Let me see what that's like.
Yeah?
Yeah, come here.
Over there? Is there enough room there?
Yeah, sure. Come here.
Yeah?
Yeah, come over here. I might as well try it.
Oh, dear.
She's a porno star, and she's nude. She looks great. No wet farts, all right?
Oh.
All right, come here. Wow. You're so Indian, you know what I mean?
Thanks.
I mean, wow, hey, this feels pretty good.
There you go.
Oh, that's disgusting. Well, this feels pretty good, and you smell real good, too.
Oh, thanks.
I don't know what else I can do, really.
I don't want to get you in trouble or anything.
I'm getting kind of excited to tell you the truth.
Is that what that is in there?
Yeah.
Or is that your keys in your pocket?
That's both.
Oh.
I only wish it wasn't my keys.
I was going to say, it takes that much to get anything going.
I can't think of anything else to do.
Well,
unless you want to get into some spanking, I'll do it.
No, that's all right.
Mm.
Yeah, thanks anyway. If I ever need one, I'll be sure to look you up.
I could get over your knee and you'd spank me?
Yeah, sure.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Do you have a favorite paddle or something?
No, something for your hand.
Oh, okay, sure.
You going to take down your pants?
Oh, I don't know.
Well, I think he has to take down his pants.
Yeah. Really?
Yeah.
And for a hand to be effective.
That's right.
And you would get off on that?
Well,
does that turn you on at all?
You're the one that brought it up.
And that turns you on?
No, not in the least.
And see, that's the thing. It doesn't even turn her on.
Oh, well.
Okay.
I like slow caresses and tender touches rather than hits and spanks and... Yeah,
but at least it's something. At least I've done something with her.
There you go.
It hasn't been a total waste. Should I do it, Robin?
Yeah, do it.
Okay. All right. Here, you sit here.
Okay.
Why do I do this?
Yeah, because you're wacky.
I'm a wacky DJ. Or maybe my wife's still asleep anyway. Jackie's like, just do it.
All right.
Get Jackie over there.
All right, hold on. What do I got to do, pull down my pants?
Yes. Why does he always crouch down when he does that?
Because I don't want you seeing.
You are very funny. As long as we've worked together, Howard.
Oh, man.
This is great.
What, you like this?
Yes, I think it's fabulous.
Get closer to the microphone.
Okay.
See, she is getting turned on.
And what do I do, go across here?
Yeah, just lay right down here across my lap.
I gotta pull down my underpants?
Yeah.
Of course.
No way. Oh, come on. I'm
Get out of here. Pull them down.
I'm naked.
What?
I'm sitting here naked.
Yeah, but you're a porno star. Before. Yeah, but you know.
You were born like that, Howard.
I don't know. It's just, there's no foreplay here.
Hey, get over that knee.
I feel a little funny about that.
Should we kiss first? Did that
help? No, I can't kiss you. I'm married.
Oh, okay. But I can spank you. Okay. Lay on down.
The spanking's all right. I don't think kissing's okay.
No, I don't think kissing would be good.
I'm embarrassed to pull down my underpants. Robin.
Pull him down.
No, I'm embarrassed.
You were supposed to be getting a spanking.
Nobody's looking.
Well, you are.
I'll keep my eyes closed.
Well,
Pull him down, Howard. Go
really?
Ahead.
I should pull him down?
Yeah.
That turns you on.
Sounds like fun.
Really?
Let her pull him down, Howard.
Well, wait a minute, Jack.
All right, if you keep your eyes closed and pull down my underpants, it's okay.
Okay.
Oh. All right?
What? What? The rule.
Yeah, well, you know, my wife wouldn't like her seeing anything.
Okay, you ready?
Okay. Go ahead.
Okay, my eyes are closed.
All right.
I'm not looking.
Ooh, is she pulling down your underpants?
Nobody's pulled down my underpants ever.
Oh, my God.
Except my wife. Okay, here
okay,
I go.
Okay, I'm ready.
All right, here, move over here.
Look, Jackie's getting himself a better view.
Oh, this is great.
How's it look?
How's his butt? He got any pimples?
No, I don't. I have a nice one, right?
Two big ones, right?
Do I have pimples? I do?
You can't see back there?
Do I have pimples?
Can't you see back there?
No, do I have? I do?
Oh, you better show me, Howard.
Wait a second. Let me think here for a second. I don't even feel a pimple.
Let me see.
You see a pimple back there?
You want me to pop it for you?
No. Oh. Is there a pimple back there?
No.
There isn't, is there?
Okay.
I knew you were lying.
How'd you go in there, though?
Disgusting. All right.
Okay.
I'll make it sensuous, at least. I mean, I'm a little...
Just lay down and take it.
I'm no zit ass.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
You been bad, boy?
Yes.
All right.
Oh.
All right.
Oh. She's spanking my back. That's what hurts the most.
You're so tall, I can't reach your bottom.
Wow. Oh, Robin.
Oh, no, you better stop.
I think I'm getting a little turned on.
I know, I can hear it.
All right, all right.
Can you hear it?
Hey, don't you know how to act? Like, isn't there, like, some kind of conversation that goes along with this?
Yeah, you've been bad. I need to spank your bottom, little boy.
All right, yeah. Doesn't hurt that much, though.
Hit him harder.
Doesn't it? Harder?
I'm waiting to see if it, like, turns me on.
Does it?
But I'm not getting that excited. This isn't that sensuous.
Yeah, I think you have to be...
This is like a spanking from hell. Oh, whoa, that turned me on.
What did she just do?
I don't know, she hit me kind of in a weird place.
Oh, sorry.
All right, now, is that it?
Oh, you want more? Okay.
No, I mean, is this the extent of our sexual play?
Oh, well, I don't know. You're the one that started this. You let me know. It's what you're into, right?
No, yeah, I'm into spanking. Sure.
Okay, is this enough?
I guess.
Are we turned on now?
A little bit.
Oh,
not
okay.
That much. I'm really not that turned on. I'll be honest with you.
Well, I think what you have to do is, like, not be so much into, like, hitting and stuff like that. We have to be more into soft, sensual touch and stuff. I think you have to pretty much, like, be a member of the Pentagon or something to be into the hitting. Get turned on by that.
Watch your fingers. This ain't bowling, huh?
Oh, okay.
All right, so that's it? That's the extent of it?
Yeah,
you're not that experienced. You're not that good. I'm not that turned on.
Really?
No.
Well, spanking's not my thing, you know?
Okay.
Yeah.
No, that was nice of you, though. Thanks.
Well,
I appreciate
anytime,
it.
Okay. You know, it was
you look
experience.
Great, though. Tell you that.
Thank you.
You look a lot better than anything I have on. No pimples on your ass. She did pull down my underpants.
Well, that must have been exciting.
It was fun.
For you.
It was.
I don't know. I don't know. It just doesn't do the trick. You know what I'm saying?
Well, look at this clinical setting. You've got things going in.
I thought she was going to start massaging me and stuff. She just didn't get into it.
If I didn't know that's what she wanted, you should have told me. You got to communicate, you know?
I can't tell you what to do. I'm a married man.
Catch 22.
You know what I mean, Robin? So people have to use initiative.
Oh.
You're not so wild. That was fun. Hyapatia Lee is appearing at Goldfinger's in Queens tonight through Saturday. Go see her. What do you think? Should that be it? Are we done?
It's up to you.
Robin, you have any other questions about porno industry?
I don't think so.
Yeah.
Can I say hello to my friends out in L.A. and tell them I wish I was out there where the weather was warm
go ahead.
Again? Yeah.
What do you need
to walk around? Alan Bossart is one of my favorite people. He's a great makeup artist. Alan Bossart.
Yeah, okay.
Name.
Go ahead. Who else?
And Stephen Hirsch from Vivid Video.
Yeah. Another Jew in the pornography industry?
He's a nice guy. One of the nicest.
Thanks for spanking me. That was nice.
Anytime, dude. Give me a call.
Really?
Yeah.
But during the commercials.
Yeah, it's the first time I've ever spanked a DJ.
Really?
Yeah, you got my cherry. Oh, geez.
All right, why don't we call it quits then? All right, everybody go to Goldfinger's in Queens tonight through Saturday. Hyapatia Lee is there dancing, and she'd like you to come see her. And, boy, they send over a lot of women, don't they?
Every week, I think, we've had someone from Goldfinger's.
And, Gary, my pants are down.
I heard.
Look. She was kidding. No. Tell everyone you were kidding.
I was kidding.
Did you see pimples on my ass?
No.
I know I don't have any pimples on my ass.
Let me see. I'll
come over here. I'll show you that. Let me see. I wouldn't mind having you spank me, Robbie. Pull down my pants with your eyes closed.
Ah, I gotta close my eyes. I'm not doing it.
How's she look, Gary? Pretty good, huh?
I'm trying not to gawk.
Better than any of the scrags you get.
Well, except for my current girlfriend.
Right. Present girlfriend not included. All right, 724-923-KROQ, WYSP, WJFK. Go over to Goldfinger's and see Hiya patiently.
The Classic. 94 WYSP, Howard Stern all morning. Classic rock and roll all day.
Maybe I should have chased her around the studio with a vibrator. I don't believe we have one here at the station, do we?
I don't think so.
Chase her around with a vibrator. Anyway, Butterbuds, right? Remember I had that big meeting with Butterbuds?
Yeah.
Butterbud Sprinkles? Jackie had to go in. I want to go see them. I got a great idea. Butterbud Sprinkles with garlic.
Oh, he wanted to bring one of his ideas to the meeting?
Yeah, he was going to bring that in.
Oh, my.
Butterbuds are great. They're in sprinkle form.
So Jackie likes Butterbuds.
Oh, everybody likes Butterbuds. Although, I don't think Butterbuds do him much good because he eats so many fattening things that... Well, I guess you might as well start...
You might as well save somewhere.
Well, it saves you getting up. You have them on the table, you just sprinkle them on your potato or on your vegetables. You don't have to get up and get out the butter.
Yeah, because what it is, it's made from real butter. Just the fat and the water have been removed.
The only... taste remains.
That's right. Only the taste remains. They're great. 4 calories a serving compared to 70 in 2 teaspoons of butter or margarine. 4 calories. No cholesterol, low sodium.
Sprinkle, that's what I like about it.
Sprinkle it on anything or just cook with it. You know, when recipes call for a stick of butter, you can use Butterbud Sprinkles and have a low-calorie dish.
That's wonderful.
You making brownies or a cake? Why are you using a stick of butter?
You get that same buttery taste
that's
without
right.
the butter.
Exactly.
You know what it's great for, Howard? Corn on the cob. Because corn on the cob is a pain in the ass to butter, but you just sprinkle it on like salt straight.
Jackie, since your parents don't do it, I'm going to talk to you about what you should be eating. Maybe it isn't corn on the cob. I got to talk to you, man. I'm worried about you. Here, listen to this. So we're in the TV meeting yesterday. I didn't even know about this because Jackie never told me.
Well, there was a reason I didn't tell you.
You didn't what? You didn't want me to know?
We were going to tape it, and then I was going to spring it on you.
Yeah, but you spring it on me. What do you have to spring that on me for? You can tape it, and I'll know about it, and I want to see it.
Well, either way.
Spring it. Like anybody can imagine what that's like.
Jackie is
the doctor.
Jackie's health is going to rapidly deteriorate. This is something I always told him because the guy really is way overweight and he doesn't eat anything
absolutely
good.
Absolutely untrue.
He eats nothing good for him.
Absolutely untrue.
Oh, you're going to say you eat good food?
My wife is a great cook. I eat great food. I just happen to like junk food once in a while for lunch.
Once in a while? That's every day.
You know what he's up to eating? He's up to eating 2 hot dogs, 2 disgusting hot dogs
that he gets from the cart. When is the last time I ate them?
He gets from a cart.
It's been 2.5 weeks since I had
them. Then he has a big hero, Italian sausage or Polish sausage.
Wrapped up in that wacky bread.
With wacky sauce and wacky stuff on it.
Well, now I got to have one today.
Then, I know, I'm getting hungry. Then he has a package of ringdings and potato chips. Now, that's lunch.
That's new.
That's new, but it's happening.
That's Ganji's fault.
Jackie goes out and says to Ganji every day, surprise me!
Yeah, just bring him whatever's out there on the street.
Surprise me with a new meal! Me and Jackie were just talking about how cute that porno star was. Forget about it. We were both like, oh, she was so perky.
She's nice.
Yeah, she was real nice. She had her hand on my ass, but barely. You know what I mean? Could tell she wasn't that into it.
Well, I suppose they have to say they're into everything. That's their business.
My ass isn't even tingling, Robin.
Really?
Nah.
Let me get a hold of you.
She was just trying to sell tickets. That's like so many funny. Girls. They all use me.
No, I'd really beat you, huh?
Yeah, they all use me. She could have made me feel good, but no.
Used again.
Yeah.
Now you feel violated.
Hey, how about me spanking you? I'm not into that. How about you spanking me? Okay, I'll do it, but I'm not really into it. Oh, great.
This is the story of your life.
This is a porno star. She's doing 2 guys at the same time. There's a girl on the bottom. And she's not really into it. I tell you, I get all the luck. All the luck. At some show I got.
Somehow, when they walk through that door, you could, like, leech the sex right out of a porno star.
Out of a porno star. You know what we're going to do from now on? I want something constructed in this studio. I want shackles. And whips.
You know, you can do that on a board. You bring in this thing on wheel.
Right.
With, you know, the bands for your arms.
Right. And then I want a spinner.
and throw knives at her.
Howard's Inferno.
Come here, my dear. Yes.
You owe a lot of people a lot of discipline.
And then we'll get like 100 vibrators.
Driver crazy.
Driver nuts.
It'd be like that. Was that a plot in a James Bond film, or was that something else I read?
I don't know. There was I know what it was. Barbarella. They gave her so many orgasms, she would die.
Yeah.
Yeah. See, I know that stuff. My command of cinema is unbelievable. Well, I saw that as a very young boy, and my father took me and had no idea it was pornographic. And we went there, and we sat and watched the whole thing, but I know my old man was real upset.
Was that really X-rated, or was it a lot?
For that time, it was pretty wild, because Jane Fonda had plastic over her breasts.
Yeah.
And then she was put in an orgasm machine that kills you.
Right.
And you see her naked, and I know my old man didn't want me sitting there next to him when girls are naked. I mean, it was definitely uncomfortable for him and for me. You don't get a chubby when you're sitting next to your old man watching a porno movie, that's for sure. You know what I mean? I think I'd even start masturbating or something.
Oh, jeez.
That would have been really embarrassing. So anyway, we're sitting in the TV meeting, and Jackie tells me that his toenails, I knew his fingernails were corroding because he puts tape over them every day, medical tape that has special medicine for his fingernails because he has a fungus.
Cortisone tape.
And he's got tape all over his hands.
Yeah, every once in a while he shows up with every finger he has taped.
Because he always had weird nails. I mean, they were always like kind of like discolored and almost like they look like the consistency of nails. They look almost.
Remember the time we saw his feet and we were like, what?
We were grossed out.
Yeah.
It was a big fungus.
Oh.
So Jackie tells me him and his wife were sitting at home and they're going through a magazine or a newspaper and it says, in the ad, it says, do your feet look like this?
It's a penny saver.
And it was, yeah, a penny saver.
Of all places to get.
Of all places to get medical help. Yeah, it's unbelievable. I say, who calls these ads for doctors in penny saver?
It spread around my feet and then spread to my fingernails because I didn't know enough to go to the podiatrist, and the doctor says 99% of people don't know enough.
But you take that explanation as gospel. You don't believe me that if you were on a proper eating diet and regimen of vitamins that your nails would clear up.
Yeah, why is this susceptible to fungi?
Yeah. Why is the fungus able to attack your feet and not, you know, that fungi is everywhere. Why is it attacking your feet and your feet are accepting it?
It attacks other people, too. Why do some people...
Other unhealthy people.
Yeah, they act just like you.
Yeah.
You get what
and
you
he's
get.
Got it on his fingers from his feet. Oh.
Well, this is a guy who stuck his finger in Tonio's buttocks.
Yeah,
when,
Tonio better go get checked.
You know, that's when the fungus started.
Yeah, seriously.
Oh, boy.
There you go. Well, it would have helped if you washed your hands after you did that instead of eating spare ribs.
All right.
You're lucky you didn't get food poisoning.
So he starts telling me how they, well, they, he goes, it's not bad. This is how out of touch he is.
You don't feel it.
You don't feel it. And they give me an injection. You don't feel it. And the next day, it's fine.
He's wearing shoes. He has no toenails.
What's that look like, man? You want to show those on the TV show?
I don't care.
That's got to be a ratings grabber.
Yeah, absolutely. Ooh. I said he's like the fly.
I'll show my Jeff Goldblum.
If I can hold my videotape between my feet, I'll show my toe.
Do you bleed when the guy does it?
I think so.
How could this help?
You're like crazy. Well, what happens is the fungus is in your toes.
In your toenails.
In your toenails, rather. It goes down into the base of them. So he has to yank out. Listen to me.
No, I can't listen to you. We're drowning you out.
He has to yank out the whole toenail.
And go down. Start calling you Jackie Fly.
And he has to go down to the base and put in the fungicide.
I bet you when your nails grow back, you're just as bad.
No, it's going to grow back perfect.
Okay.
Martin fly.
I bet you they
Did you save them?
Of course.
Oh, yeah.
No, I saved them.
His feet are so weird. Hey, do me a favor. Now, when do you have the last two pulled out?
Maybe Thursday. I asked the doctor if we could come in and videotape, and he thought I was crazy, and then he thought I was kidding, and now I think he realized I'm telling the truth.
Yeah, you got to do it. And do me a favor.
But he's got like three offices, and the only way I can go in on Thursday is in Wantagh, so...
Can you do me a favor? Would you videotape...
That was my idea.
Would you videotape the two toes that, you know, the two toenails that are still there? It's just so people can see what they used to look
before
like.
Before and after.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Of course.
Because
we're in all stages. I have three that were done 2 weeks ago, three that were done last week, two that were done yesterday.
Yeah, and then we want to see the full set of 10 grown back.
Yeah, do they grow back? You know, sometimes they don't.
square business.
No. Sometimes they don't, sometimes they do. He said these were healing really well, and he thought they'd grow back. So what we'll do is take a little videotape each week for, you know, and then we'll show some time lapse in a
time lapse, yeah. Now, all I want to see is, I just want to see your feet without any toenails.
Oh, you don't want to see him ripping them out?
Yeah, I want to see all that. I want to see it all.
I want it all.
This is little toe is real weird.
The other day when he was doing it, all of a sudden it hit me. I said to myself, would this be funny on TV or would it be horrible or would it be one of those
things? It would be horrible, but...
But nobody would turn it off.
Right.
It'd be compelling in a weird way.
I might have to turn it off.
Well, they're going to have to rip his fingernails out pretty soon anyway.
Yeah, your fingernails. What does he say about your fingernails?
He gave me fungicide and they're just about cured.
Let me see.
What is this, school?
Yeah, they do look... They look.
But he's still got the tape on the thumb.
Yeah, the thumbs.
Because my thumbs still had some of it, so I put that on the thumb so it wouldn't spread to the other, so they're fine.
You don't think that this is a...
And this is like recurrent. He can't get rid of this.
No. He's
this
like an AIDS victim.
No.
You're like an AIDS victim.
No, wait a minute. Oh, no. I finally went to the doctor.
You know, AIDS guys...
Now I'm being cured.
Guys die from athlete's foot when they get AIDS because their immune system is so weak.
You know, this is like a flashback to me. Oh,
man. Yeah, I know what you're talking about. Yeah.
No.
You're going to check out one day. I'm telling you, Jackie. All of a sudden, boom.
Yeah, I got AIDS.
I'm not saying you have AIDS, but it's very similar. Your immune system.
I've never seen anybody with terminal fungus in the feet.
Yeah,
Howard, you had an extra hole in your rear end, and you didn't die. I don't think
I healed it myself.
Well, what do you think I'm doing?
I didn't have an operation.
Rip out his butt.
So what should I do? What you do? Take some vitamins and bark at the moon? I went to a doctor.
Let me continue eating the way you're eating and exploding. And you know why you're mad at me, man? Because you know your parents should sit you down and say this to you, or your wife, or somebody.
His parents,
because they care about you.
I am so thrilled that I went to the doctor and got this done. I never done it.
But you kept getting infected. We kept asking you about your fingers.
Why did you get it done? Did your feet hurt?
No, they were just ugly. I had weird toenails. I cut one of my toes pretty bad when I was a kid. It never grew in right.
Yeah. So he's had this...
I don't know what he's had.
Since he was a kid.
How much you want to bet Jackie just sort of unexpectedly drops dead one day?
Absolutely, I know.
I better ask for a lot of money.
Yeah.
Because if I'm going to die soon...
Why do you need money if you're dead? That makes no sense.
Maybe I don't need any money at all.
If you're going to live, I would ask for a lot of money.
Yeah.
That's true.
But he's always got these little things.
I'm going to outlive all of you, and it drives you crazy.
Right,
you're the
we'll
one that walks in here sick every other week. And
who
I'm,
does? When's the last time I was sick? How dare you?
You're always bitching and moaning that I'm healthy and you're not, and you eat everything right. And I
no, I'm bitching that you're not sicker than you are from what you're eating.
I'm never sick.
We'll see what happens.
Always got something going on. He's either
like what?
Diarrhea.
Yeah, it's always like,
he's got his fingers. You hear Jackie and he's like,
I always have diarrhea.
You go in the bathroom, he's always like,
I haven't even been having those daily movements anymore. I've been very healthy.
And he's pushing and his problems.
Sweating
in there.
That's not true.
It is true. We all walk in there. We see what's going on.
That's like Jackie's second job.
Yeah.
I haven't been in there on a daily basis in 6 months. And you know it.
Very good. All right. There he is, Jackie Martling. Our very own Jackie Martling, who will be appearing tomorrow night, October 9th, the big show at Bananas Comedy Club in the Radisson Hotel in Poughkeepsie, New York. For jokes and information, dial 516-922-WINE. Jackie's 13 Wild Party cassettes available at all Tower Records and Sam Goody's on both coasts. All right, very good.
Thanks.
All right, now, next for your listening pleasure, I'm going to play you that song that was written about basically me and you.
Yeah, from Two Live Crew.
Yeah, we had to bleep out every other word, but you still get the idea.
Oh, okay.
All right, we'll take a break.
I was wondering if you'd be able to get the gist of it.
It's pretty difficult, but you'll understand it.
Okay.
And,
Is it any good? I want it to be a hit if it's about it.
I have my thoughts on that as well. It's not very good.
Oh.
741-923 K-Rock WYSP WJFK. After these words, we'll take your phone calls. We'll play you the song. And we're going to spin the wheel for Los Angeles and play one of our classic bits. And today, I will go in and produce Andy of Mayberry Meets the Ku Klux Klan.
Well, is it written?
No, we're going to write it and produce it today.
Oh, okay.
That's our jobs for today. We know that. We know what we have to do. Fred probably and Jackie have already probably prepared something, I'm sure.
I finished the script already.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
He wrote it with his toes.
Should only happen to me. It's because he having his toenails pulled. That'll all be done. Unless Jackie drops dead, I think we should hold off the bit for a day.
That's nice.
All right. We'll be back right after these words. And I just innocently said that those guys deserve to be behind bars. You know, they look like guys who deserve to be behind bars.
And then you sort of drew bars across their face to see what they would look like.
Yeah, they're rap stars. You know how those rap stars look. Don't they all look like criminals to you? I mean, seriously, let's be honest.
Let's think of one who doesn't.
Right.
Young MC.
That's it. He's the only good one. He's the only one I like.
Because he's nice.
Almost as nice as Sinbad.
Not quite as nice as Sinbad. But some of these rap stars, and from what I understand, a lot of them are criminals. They've been up on charges.
Yeah. A lot of them already have rap sheets. That's why they call it rap music.
Right. That's where it comes from. They're long rap sheets. So Robin had a picture of them showing what they looked like. Because remember the controversy? Their record was banned.
Yeah, and they were in court and everything, so.
Which was the best thing for them, because the record wasn't even that good.
Yeah, it made them famous.
And it sold a lot of albums for them, because they were up on this obscenity charge. Yeah. So the point was, when I saw it, I said, gee, you know, in a way, they'd be doing us a favor if they convict them of the obscenity charge and put them behind bars, because they look like criminals. So I guess they didn't like that.
Well, this sent them right back to the desk to write another song.
And they wrote a song about it, but I got to be honest with you. This song, when you hear it, it's not a song.
Can you really call it a song?
It's not technically a song. It's like a Gil Scott-Heron record, like Whitey on the Moon or something, because it's like a bunch of bongo playing and them yelling stuff about me.
Let me hear this.
And you too, because you're the bitch who sits next to me.
Yeah. My distinction in life.
Yeah.
Oh, you're the bitch that sits next to me.
The song is called I Ain't Bull Essin.
Oh.
You can't even say the name on the air. And there's a bleep every other word. Here we go. Ready?
Now this other motherfucker.
Oh,
this
boy.
Redneck motherfucker from New York. I mean, you know, long haired hippie, Howard, some old fucked up name on a. I mean, the motherfucker got a nerve to talk shit. I mean, this motherfucker looks like a leftover junkie from Woodstock. I mean, this bitch got a nerve to say Two Live Crew look like they do good behind bars. And the bitch put us behind bars on TV.
Oh, he's calling you a bitch. Howard.
No, you're the bitch.
No, he's calling you a bitch.
He's calling me a bitch?
Yeah.
Hey, man, I ain't his bitch. I'll kick his ass. He won't know what hit him. Who writes that?
I don't mind that so much anymore.
Yeah, I think no, because it says the bitch who sits next to him.
Well, then he did call me a bitch.
Right.
Well, now I'm upset again.
Yeah, you better not.
Because it feels like he's calling you a bitch.
I ain't nobody's bitch. Boy. You know how you look good in the reader. Now, he might be calling me a bitch.
I think he's calling you a bitch.
I'm reading over the lyrics here.
Yeah.
I don't see anything about you.
It doesn't say the bitch that sits next to him. He says this bitch.
Let me tell you something, boy. I ain't your bitch. If anybody's going to be somebody's bitch, it's going to be you underneath me. Let me tell you that right now. I ain't nobody's bitch. Let's get back to the song.
Yeah.
You look good in a rehab center, you and your motherfucking glasses. You need to stop hiding behind your shit. I bet your eyes are red like a motherfucker. Red. Your eyes are so red, you all that show. I know it. The bitch by you know it.
That's me.
Yeah, that's it. You're the bitch sitting next to me. You're a bitch too.
We're both bitches.
Yeah. Two bitches. Says the bitch sitting next to you know it, and the producer know it.
And Howard. Well, as you know,
this is not a song.
Yeah, can you call that a song?
No.
Then I've written songs.
When you go on one of your tirades today during the news, I could play bongos behind that.
Forgive me some bongos. I'll write a song about them.
You write songs every day, if that's a song.
Yeah, I got a four-hour song a day. Now, let me tell you something, Robin. Now,
what?
I'll tell you, what the hell is this? That's Robin in the background.
I'm trying to help.
Now, I'm going to tell you something. I ain't no bitch. I ain't nobody's bitch. Because before you get me underneath you, man, there's gonna be one bitch here putting up a big struggle. You're gonna have to deal with that, mother effer. You understand what I'm saying? And I'm gonna tell you, I'm gonna say it again. You guys look like criminals. What am I gonna say? I ain't saying you is criminals. I'm saying you look like criminals. And believe me, you guys look like you're guilty of something.
You're probably up to something anyway.
Right. I wish they'd throw your whole freaking band in jail. What do you think of that? Why do you rap guys look like you should be in jail? Now, you listen to Brother Howard here. You better steal a TV and hit me over the head with it. Because otherwise, I'm going to ride your butt like Roy Rogers.
like I wrote Trigger. And don't tell me I'm your bitch. I don't mind you saying maybe I look like I'm a drug addict, but I can deal with that. That's the look I'm going for.
You would look good in a rehab center.
Yeah, I would, wouldn't I? But I'm proud of that. You need a bitch, you go ride Gary Delabate. Now, homos like him. So if I'm your bitch, what are you saying about yourself? You're a homo? Is that what you're saying? Huh? You better think about that. My song is just, you know what, and you know what else is the bottom line? My song is every bit as good as yours.
Yeah, absolutely.
Every bit as good.
Just as much musical integrity.
Name of the song is Every Bit as Good.
We ought to record it and send it to him.
My song is every bit as good as yours. My song is every bit as good as yours. I said, my song is every bit as good as yours. So what's that say about your profession? Now you call me a bitch, but you might be a fudge wrestling felon if you call me that. Because that means you want me sexually, don't it? Now let me tell you something. If you get me in a hole, mother effer, your butt's going to be every bit as sore as Liberace. Because you're going to be my bitch when I get a hold of you. So you just keep your big trap shut. Here comes the finale. 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 My song is every bit as good as yours. So what's that say about your profession? My song. When I'm done with you, there'll be room in your butt for a 35-inch Mitsubishi television set. So if I'm your bitch, man, you better get ready. Yeah. Because my song is every bit as good as your song.
My song is every bit as good as your song.
Let me hear you say
what? My song. Let me hear you say what?
Ho.
Say ho.
That's what they do.
Say ho, damn it.
Rap music. I just wrote a song that's as good as that guy's song. That was as good as that guy's song. What's that say about the rap industry?
Well, let's say Two Live Crew. They're not all of rap.
Nah, come on. Let's be honest.
You know, Howard, you look good in a rehab center. You and your motherfucking glasses. You need to stop hiding behind them shit.
Sounds like they think I look handsome to them. I think I...
Why do you say that?
I look good to them in those shades.
Did they say that?
Well, yeah. It said I look good in my shades in a rehab center, but, you know, more or less. Let's rename them, too. Two Little Talent, not Two
yeah,
Live Crew.
Okay.
Two Little Talent.
Two Little Talent.
I bet your eyes are red like a mother. Red, red, red. Your eyes are so red.
You this is Gil Scott Heron.
That show, I knew it. The bitch by you knew it. The producer knew it. I knew it. And Howard. Well, as you know,
I'm pretty honored that anybody would put me in a song, though. I got to be honest.
Well, I wish it was a song.
Yeah, well, it's a closer
thing.
Guy
talking with music under him.
It is kind of neat, though. At least we're in something.
Yeah, we're on record.
Yeah, at least we're on disc. Although I did appear on the Blue Oyster Cult album.
Well, yeah, that was a performance.
I don't know if the people of Los Angeles
I think
that
was that. The first rap record.
Yeah. I won't play that right now. All right, 758 923 K Rock WYSP WJFK. Let's take a break. Bring Stutter and John in. Let's hear his interview with Mary Tyler Moore and Valerie Harper and all the rest of those people.
See what he's been up to. Yeah.
See what he's been up to. Then we'll do some news. We'll take your phone calls. And I really do have to look for a dial a day for this Friday. I want to, you know, I want to sort of get that going again.
Well, what do we have in mind? Do we have any category?
Yeah, I'll tell you about it in a few minutes, right after these words. Thank you. 8:05, 92.3 K-Rock, WYSP, WJFK. Stutter and John, why don't you get in here?
He looks kind of depressed.
Oh, he's real depressed. Because he's an imbecile and he doesn't listen to me.
Oh.
You know why you're depressed? Because you're an imbecile and you don't listen to me.
No, that's not really why.
Oh, yeah. That's exactly why.
I don't think so.
I don't think you should have gone to Los Angeles. Don't you agree? What happened?
Which... where do you want to start?
What?
Where do you want to start?
Where do you want to start?
Yeah.
Here we go. All right, Fred, don't start in yet.
Not yet. I got to know why he's looking like he's ready to jump.
First of all, your hair is disgustingly greasy and smelly. What have you put
First of all, it ain't greasy. I took a shower this morning. I just put a hat on.
Oh, is that what that is?
It's cold out.
Wow.
And I didn't have a chance to blow dry it, so this is how it dries. It dries.
Why don't you list the good points of your trip to California for us? There were none, right?
I got Mary Tyler Moore, Valley Hopper.
Well, you did some good stuff for us, but that's what you're good at. He goes out there, he pays $2,000 for his whole band to go out there. And what happened? They almost didn't even let you play in the studio.
They really screwed us over. I don't care anymore. They really gave us the shaft. And although we...
How did they give you the shaft?
All right. After I interviewed Andy Michael Hall, it was there. They wanted me to go there, you know, because they wanted me to get some stuff which will help publicize the organization that ran this whole thing. Okay?
In other words, they invited you because you gave them free plugs on my radio show.
And so I could interview some people and people would hear about their organization, right? That was the, you know...
So in other words, again, and you didn't get paid for this by them, did you? You had to pay out of your own pocket. You not only advertised...
No, I didn't pay for...
You not only advertised their thing for free, but schmuck that you are, you ended up paying for your own plane ticket down there and paying for your band's plane ticket.
Well, everybody does
now
that.
Now you're at $2,000.
No, everybody does actually...
No, everybody doesn't have a radio gig to plug them on. No.
He thinks they asked him down there because his band is...
No. I understood that it was because...
So you say to him, you want free advertising? You pay for my plane fare to come down there. And you treat me like a human being when I get there.
Well, that's what didn't happen. So we went there, and then I got into Michael Hall and everything. And then it was like the whole hotel, a whole bunch of parties, right?
Yeah.
So they invite me to, some girl invites me to a party, right? So
listen, do me a favor. Stay on the track here. Why did they screw you over?
I'm telling you right now.
All right, so a girl invites you to a party.
Do you want to hear the story? You want me to, I mean, I'm trying to get...
No, but you tell a story, it takes hours.
I leave the tape recorder in the room. We're about to leave. I go, wow, the tape recorder. The Marantz, you know.
Go ahead.
So I'm like, I got to get it back. So I knock on the door. I go, yo, you guys have my tape recorder? They go, no, it's not in here, sorry. And they wouldn't let us in the door. So my roadie's behind me, pushes open the door.
Your roadie?
Yeah, and I have two guys with me, like two bookends with me.
Yeah.
So
imagine this guy has a roadie. He doesn't have a record contract. Doesn't have...
These are guys hanging out, Howard.
Yeah, roadie. Right. My roadie.
All right.
He thinks he's Bon Jovi. My roadie.
Which is another... All right. So then they push open the door.
Yeah.
There, the tape recorder is sitting on the bed, right? So this guy's still in front of me. So I push the guy against the bed. Then another guy goes to pop me. So my roadie pops him. So they start brawling and stuff. So I jump in and like break it up, right? So it's
Wait a second. Who are these guys that you're having a fight with? Are the guys from the concert that you're playing with?
It was one of the guys from the organization that...
There are 12 million people in Los Angeles, and you start a fight with the guy promoting the concert.
I didn't start the fight. So then they start fighting. I break it up.
Yeah.
So then that night he goes, don't worry, everything's fine. It was, you know, silly, everything. Next night I hear that...
Why did he want to let you in to get your tape recorder?
That's the point. They were just being jerks. And it's a God's honest truth. I have witnesses. The hotel security saw it and said...
Look at this.
Oh, never mind.
Why is your tape recorder in his room?
Because there was girls and guys in the room. The girls invited us to come down and party with them, so we went there, hung out, and then we split because it was bogus. We said, ah, let's just go to because there's gay sheesh all over the place.
Right.
So I split and I left the I left the tape recorder in there.
Taking care of your job is what you're saying.
All right. So let's say he left the tape recorder. But look at this. He's starting a fist fight with a guy who promotes the concert.
All he had to do was keep his tape recorder.
I didn't start any fight with
anybody.
So
all of a sudden, after you promoted it on the radio, you talked about this guy's organization. You amaze me.
So then at 9 o'clock, I hear...
They're not allowed.
I hear that Josie Sang is banned. We're not allowed within a 2-mile radius of the hotel.
All right.
So then I called up...
I thought your band isn't called Josie Sang anymore.
Well, it is. So then I called up...
You told me you were going to a new name.
Yeah,
tell everyone that new name?
I don't know yet. We haven't settled on something
yet. Tell me the name.
Pilgrim State.
Well, that's one of them I was...
Pilgrim State.
Yes,
what was the other one?
One Clocks Boulevard was another one.
One Clocks Boulevard. Yeah. I told them, if you name your band One Clocks Boulevard, it's the most stupid name I ever heard.
He is the world's worst name
picker. He goes, that's where we practice. I said, listen, you can name an album that. You know, that's sort of like...
But not your band.
Yeah.
All right. So anyway, Harry, so then I hear that we're banned from the show. So I call up that night. I say, listen, guys.
Why don't you name your band Punching the Promoters? Because that's what you do. That's really bright.
I didn't punch anybody. That's the point. I didn't hit anybody.
What's amazing to me, you put yourself in a situation where you give them my free advertising... And then you go out there and you're treated like a jerk.
Yes,
and what makes me mad, that's your fault.
Well,
I told you that this thing wouldn't pay off for you.
Well, you're
I told
right.
you no one's going to even be at the showcase.
You were right. I shouldn't have went.
Who was there that saw you? What record company?
The same guys who would have saw me here.
Exactly. What did I tell you before
you
left?
I told him that.
You're right.
I told you the same guys who come here.
You're right.
Are the same guys who were
but
there.
But listen to this.
But you don't listen to me,
this
do
isn't
you?
The worst of it, Howard.
But why don't you listen to me? Why do you waste my time?
Well, L.A. is a great place to be, you know.
All right, good. All right. And now you're out $2,000.
All right, listen to me. Can I finish the story? Then listen to this. So then I call
What a coincidence. They got the advertising, and then they canceled
them. Howard, then I call up that night and say that. I go, listen, I'll sue you because
You're going to sue him.
Yeah, because not only...
Who is going to take that case?
Well, I'll take it if I had to.
What are your damages?
$2,000? $2,000 plus...
Yeah, there are a lot of lawyers out there looking for $2,000 cases.
More than that anyway.
Oh, what would the damages?
Because that's not included food, that's not included per diem.
$2,500.
Per diem.
Per diem.
So then...
Why don't you name your band Josie Sue?
Yeah. So then how... This is the point of the story where Chuck calls me.
All right, so I call... Yeah. No.
Looking for Dominic Barber's number.
First,
you're going to bother my friend, my associate, Dominic Barber.
First.
You're going to bother him with your stupid, trivial case.
First, what I do is I call up
Do me a favor. Don't assume you're me, that Dominic Barber wants to hear from you.
Dominic Barber's secretary would have done in this situation.
I don't care. Wait a second. Suddenly you and Dominic Barber now are like this?
I love Dominic, man.
So you love him because I tell you who to love.
Hey,
I don't see any other lawyers latching on to you. Everything's through this show. Everybody uses contacts from this show. And before you call any lawyer, you call me.
I was looking for the number to Jacoby
and
Myers.
And don't call
me.
Matter.
Anybody would have sufficed.
Yeah.
Listen to this, Howard.
Call Dominic Barber when you want to pose in Playboy. That's what he's good for.
Howard, that night I call up, right? And I tell the guy, listen, this is bogus, everything. So the next morning, 2 o'clock in the morning,
yes.
They call up us and say that we're in. But now we're invited
now,
back.
Okay, so now you're in.
So
like the big
in.
Pussy that you are, you go back and do it.
So we go there, and they have us on for 3 songs, and then...
Of course.
And they kick us off, and then I say, well, I'm playing one more, and then they kick 4
of
songs.
Of course.
The whole trip was for 4 songs.
So if there was anybody from the record industry there, you were embarrassed.
And then...
You were embarrassed in front of the record
industry. And then people from record companies tell me that I'm going to get screwed when I get back to New York, because this is like the big... I really blew it this time. I see David Bryan from Bon Jovi. I go up to him. I go, hey, Dave, what's up? He goes, oh, man, you blew it.
Ooh.
He goes, no, but not about this. About
what?
About the interviews.
Well, because you interviewed Bon Jovi.
Man, they did Bon Jovi. Goes,
oh,
you blew it.
Blew it. Why did you blow it?
The whole record industry.
Well, the whole record industry is against you now. When are you going to smarten up?
He said, you stepped over the line, man.
When are you going to smarten
up? The line.
When a loser like David Bryan comes up to you and says you blew it.
What line?
Where is this line?
I just call him an artificial rock star, man.
You ever hear of a band called Guns N' Roses?
Yeah.
They make Bon Jovi look like two a bunch of girls. Don't you think they would have blown it by now by all the people they piss off? You put out some good music. Wait, let's see what David Bryan does. With all his kowtowing and ass-licking, let's see if he ever gets a solo album deal, and let's see if he ever gets a hit on his own. All his ass-licking isn't going to pay off. Ass licking. This is an industry of talent. You want to go around lick ass all day?
No, I don't. I don't.
Go ahead and lick ass. Get out of here.
I don't.
You want to lick it? You know what? You're a big loser. Get out of here. You distress me. You lose $2,000. You don't listen to me. And you get influenced by David Bryan.
I didn't get influenced. I called him an artificial rock
and
roll
star. You started calling me and you started whining at Gary.
Gary, I was...
I heard you were almost crying.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, I was crying, Gary.
David Bryan will be stocking shelves in a year, and you're worried about it.
Along with the exaggeration that I called your house a million times. So much exaggeration
don't
here on the radio.
Don't you dare call my house again.
Gary told me to. I don't...
One time, then you're calling me constantly with your problem.
I called one other time. Look at the exaggerations, man. Theater of the mind.
Yeah, theater of the mind. Theater of the mindless.
And I didn't call up Gary crying. I called up just Gary just to get his opinion on something. And
did
then
you call Gary at 1 o'clock in the morning looking for a lawyer?
No, it was 12 o'clock your time, 12:30 your time, 9:30 my time.
Oh, so you're not aware that it's 12:30 at night.
But it was on Saturday. What was it, a Friday night? Friday night,
for the ridiculous request for a lawyer's
Friday
number.
Night. And plus, then you guys are saying that I didn't leave phone numbers. I call from the Beverly Hilton. That's where I interviewed Mary Tomo. I don't know the phone number to the Beverly Hilton.
How can anyone get back to
then
you?
Then why hang
questions?
Up?
I was just calling in hope that they would be there to pick up the phone. If they're not, then
he calls my house, right? He says he needs questions for Mary Tyler Moore. I said, okay, you know, he calls Jackie. Jackie says, fine, I'm going to write some questions for you. Leaves a number. No one can get back in touch with this guy.
Well, I don't understand.
I
left the number with Jackie, so I don't see how that couldn't. I don't see how that.
We couldn't even get through to you.
What happened was I was walking out the door and he called me, so I got the number where he was. I wrote the questions on the way to my folks' house. When I got there, I called the number. I got a recording saying, "If you know the room number, plug. You know, press it in." I pressed it in. It said, "Now we're making a transfer."
they played a little music on hold, mm-hmm. and all of a sudden dial tone came up.
Right.
I did it three or four times.
And then what about
Howard? And I said, what do we do? We don't know. There's no other way to get a hold of him. So I was hoping that maybe he'd call us back. So then he called Nancy. He called up Nancy and said, where's Jackie with the question? She said, he's at his folks' house. I'm sure he's been trying to call you.
Doesn't leave a fax number, nothing.
You have my fax number.
But I went to my folks' house. I told you I was on my way. My folks don't have a fax machine. I didn't know that. I had a phone number.
You're difficult to reach.
I gave him the hotel number and a fax number. What did I do wrong?
Were you on the phone?
No, I was waiting for the
phone. What you did wrong? You want to know what you did wrong? If you had a half a brain, I'll tell you what you did wrong, okay? Then listen to me.
After a half hour, you would have called back and
said questions. You called Gary. All right. Gary's your point man. Then you send Gary to get in touch with Jackie, me, and Fred.
Gary, I don't think. Did I call you that day?
And then it's his responsibility to get the questions. And then you can call Gary's machine every 15, 20 minutes, a half hour until you get him.
No, but make sure you're not on the phone.
Jackie. I'll be quiet.
See, you know, you told me to
he's
call
not
Jackie.
He's listening to you.
He doesn't listen to me.
You told me to call Jackie. He's what he should have done. Right.
Well, between John and Gary, nothing ever gets done.
Oh, you told me to call Jackie, didn't you, Howard? Be honest for a second. You told me call Jackie.
You were calling my house. I couldn't take it. I couldn't take it anymore. I said, call Jackie. I can't be bothered with you every minute calling my house with a different problem.
But see,
with David Bryan and Bon Jovi and I'm
you're
ruined.
Listening to all this on
I'm
the
listening
phone?
To all this. I said, get off my phone.
And this was an hour. Howard, this was an hour before he was going to leave. Now,
of course.
If 45 minutes had gone by, he should have called back my house and said, where's Jackie with the questions? Nancy would have said, call him at his folks' house. He would have called me and I would have said, John, why, have you been on the phone? Why couldn't I get through? Well, here's the questions. But he did what he did. He called Nancy.
All right, let's move on.
Oh,
now we
no,
did get no,
no
please.
But this is very important.
I can't take it anymore.
But he didn't call back until he was walking out the door. She said, "Call Jackie. He's got the questions at his folks' house." And John said, "I don't have time. I'm walking out the door," which made no sense.
Because first of all, nobody seemed real into it. So I there was no way I was going to call you. I mean, I didn't know if you wrote questions. I had no idea.
I had 25.
You said, well, I have a lot of family stuff to take care of. I said, all right, Jack. I go, I don't want to be a pain in the
ass. All right. Listen, I my head is spinning. This is what went on all weekend.
All weekend.
Right?
Hey, listen.
The first time he called, he said, Jack, call me, and didn't leave a number.
Yeah, call me and doesn't leave a number. Can you imagine?
That's a lie, too.
That's not
a lie? It is a lie. I call up and say, Jackie, you're there, we get you. I didn't, because I was at the Beverly Hills.
All right.
All right, forget it.
The classic.
No. I wasn't asking you for that.
What were you asking?
I wanted him to start stuttering.
And the whole thing, the only reason why I was calling everybody so I can get some good material out there. I worked 3 to 4 days for the.
All right.
That I was out there for this. What do I get?
All right, please. I'm getting a headache.
Call 3 or 4 days out there. I don't want to bother. I don't know the number of Beverly Hills Hilton. You're busy at your folks. I don't want to bother you. David Bryan says I'm through. I got Mary Tyler Moore. I give Ellie Hopper.
That's the full call.
I'm kissing Ed Asner.
All right, why don't we take a break? We'll take a break, and we'll hear what happened when Stuttering John met the following people. Anthony Michael Hall, Mary Tyler Moore, Valerie Harper, Lee Iacocca, Tom Sullivan, and Barbara Eden. So it was a pretty good miniseries, actually. How many videos does it come out on? Video stores, you can rent one episode, you want to see them all. Four cassettes, that's good. You get all four cassettes of the Thornbirds. Rachel Ward was beautiful in that.
Yes, she was.
Just before she started uglying herself up.
She did that?
Yeah, I don't know. She don't look that good now. She looked great then. I think there's even a scene where she gets all wet, and you can see her breasts through her shirt. Isn't that right? Because they were...
I don't... Did she get wet? I don't remember that.
I remember her and Richard Chamberlain walking on the beach.
Yeah, there was a lot of beach scenes.
Yeah, a lot of beach stuff. And Richard Chamberlain was the priest.
And everybody wanted him.
Yeah, but then you see Rachel Ward and you go, okay, yeah. Screw those vows. I mean, I know I'm married to Jesus, but hey, haven't gotten laid in 20 years.
He didn't have any trouble keeping his vows when Barbara Stanwyck was trying to get him.
No, that was easy. Barbara Stanwyck's after him all the time, some old ratty looking Barbara Stanwyck. He's like, hey, no problem. I'm committed to Jesus.
Hey.
I'm very flattered.
I'm celibate.
Yeah.
I'm loving it.
I love being celibate. And Barbara Stanwyck's my alternative, but then it was all of a sudden Rachel Ward and the guy just goes. Anyway, it's available now at your local video store, Thornbirds. That's what I do on Saturday nights. I rent a video, get into bed, watch the thing, lay there like a lox. Go out to eat dinner and I run home and watch it. I actually got to the movies last Saturday night.
What'd you see?
I saw that horrible movie, The Doctor. Oh,
I haven't seen that.
It's insufferable.
Really?
It's, you know, William Hurt's a great actor. He's really a great actor.
Yes, he is.
And anything he's in, I'd go see. But for crying out loud, it's so sappy. Sitting there, he gets cancer. It's a,
I got sucked into Regarding Henry, which is basically the same thing.
Yeah, this is the same thing.
Yeah.
You know how people say The Doctor's better than Regarding Henry? It's, well, Regarding Henry was really bad. Because, you know, all of a sudden the guy's like,
well, he wasn't that bad. But he was sort of like a retarded guy.
Yeah. All of a sudden he's a retard. And then he becomes a good guy. Like being retarded is good.
Yeah, that was good.
Yeah.
Now his wife's hot for him.
Yeah. But the first whole, like, half of the movie is following this guy around and he's having tests. You feel like you're watching that channel on TV with
Lifetime. On Sunday.
Yeah, on Sunday. And they're showing you medical stuff. Sitting there going, what the hell? There's so many good movies out. What am I doing here?
Yeah, why do we have to be in a hospital? Well, I came up for entertainment.
My wife insisted on seeing that movie. She insisted on me going to the movies because she doesn't get to go out on Saturday nights anymore. She doesn't get to go out. She don't get to go. I said, where are you going every minute? I'm exhausted. Why are you tired? Why are you busier so you're not tired on Saturday? Why are you so wide awake? We need our time. But time. I'm sitting there next to a movie. I've got this great movie. I sit down in a movie. And the doctor was filled with all old people. Disgusting, noisy old people. I swear to God. They
that was in the audience.
The audience. Yeah, not the movie.
You meant the movie.
No, I mean the... No, the movie's filled with very attractive young people. You know, a good cast. But I go to sit down, right? Well, I'm so tall. Well, the second I sit down, you got to come to a movie with me one time. The second I sit down, I tower over everyone. You hear behind me, first you hear, he's so tall. And they say it out loud like, I'm going to get up and move. I ain't moving anywhere.
Or you're supposed to scrunch down in your chair or something.
That's why the movies suck. It's a group experience. I don't want to be around a group. But I never have noisy people behind me because now they all get up and leave. So they go, and they say it out loud so that I'll hear it. I'm not getting up and leaving. I'm not going to move up my chair.
We were here first.
Yeah, and it's like, you know, hey, screw you. What do you mean? I'm not allowed to sit here?
What, am I supposed to cut off my legs?
Yeah.
To see
what am I, some jerk that is in the way of your life? You know. And they're all back there coughing their death rattles. They all got some kind of cough going with their arthritic bodies. And their pills and they're shuffling around.
You wonder if they actually enjoy the movie. They just come to a dark place to sleep.
Well, one couple got up and left. I saw that. They couldn't take it because, I mean, I think it was a little too close to reality, all these medical experiments. I think they're going through it on a daily basis. But all of them were back there whining and bitching. It was the greatest thing. I can't see. He's so tall.
And half the time they're repeating dialogue to each other because they
missed. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
What did he say?
They all clear out behind me. Miseries. They're all a couple of years away from being led around by black people in the old age home. And I fix them all. That's an interesting generation. That's sort of the generation that ignored black people. Now, suddenly, when they turn old, they have to go into the old age home. And all the old age homes are run by black people.
Run by black people, oh, yeah. They don't see any white people anymore.
No. It's unbelievable. It's almost like hell.
God is very odd in that way.
Yeah, isn't it?
He likes to play jokes on people like that.
I'm working on a film treatment about that, about how this racist guy's whole life, he's going around racist, and then all of a sudden, his worst nightmare comes true. He ends up in a living hell because he has to go into an old age home where it's only black people.
Well, I'm telling you, I see them walking down the street. You'd see these white men, like, holding on to these black women like they're their girlfriends.
Yeah, it's great. That goes, Manhattan's filled with that. I bet you they have that in Los Angeles and Washington and Philly, too. The real old people who seem to have enough money to keep themselves out of the old age home, but they're holding on for dear life to these black people. They have, like, a black nurse.
And you should
nurse.
See them. You should see, and you hear them talk to them.
Yeah.
Oh, they're really sweet.
No, oh, they got to be sweet.
Oh, are they sweet?
Because the
they?
Black guy will take them and not give them their bath for 3 days. It's pretty wild, and they all wear uniforms, all the black people.
Right.
It's pretty wild.
Yeah, but they're hugging them.
Yeah.
That was the other thing. I said, you know, because you see a lot of black nurses with these white babies, and everybody wants the nurse in the uniform.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, like somebody's going to think that's her baby.
You know what's great about it is, too, because, you know, nowadays every black guy is hostile to white people, so he must, you know, they must be real uncomfortable. And you know what's great about it, too, because I'm finally getting my payback. All of those whiteys who ran from Roosevelt are getting older and older. I was a kid growing up in a black community, and all the whiteys made one big exodus. If they'd all sat tight, we would have had a nice community, but they all left. But I know in a couple of years they're going to be entering the old age homes. I can't wait to see what
they
happens.
They will be moving into a black neighborhood.
Oh, yeah. You wait and see. Because their kids don't want them, because they're miseries. Life's great. All right. Let's get back to it.
You gotta think about these things when you're being a bastard now.
Yeah.
Think about where it ends you up.
You wait and see what happens. It's gonna be great. Just desserts. All right, Stuttering John.
Now on to you.
Let's get back to torturing you.
Why, this was great.
What was he? He was whining during the commercials. I wasn't crying. You're whining about everything. And what was this? Your tape recorder? You went to get Jodie Foster and your tape machine didn't work? And
no, we...
Why is it we don't have a tape recorder that works?
I was working on this stuff, but then at some point during this stuff, the microphone went out.
You say it was working during this stuff, but at some point during this stuff, the microphone went out. So yeah. It wasn't working during this stuff.
Well, it was, and it broke.
So it didn't work?
No, it stopped working.
Okay.
Oh, dear.
All right, let's see who you got. Who's up first? Anthony Michael Hall.
Yes.
Well, boy, we haven't heard from him in a while. He was the guy in all the John Hughes movies. He was with Molly Ringwald all the time.
Yes.
And then he went on Saturday Night Live, and nobody heard from him again. All right, here we go.
Anthony, come on, we gotta go.
Come here. I got you a question first. Come here for a second, please, please. Anthony, this is the Howard Stern Show.
You with the Howard Stern Show?
Howard Stern Show, tape of Broadway.
I love Howard.
All right, I got to ask you a question. Hold on, let me just get this up.
Oh, that's good.
That's a nice endorsement.
That's very nice. Yeah.
Hold on. All right. Anthony, how are you?
Lovely.
All right. Let me ask you a question. Why do you avoid Howard Stern?
Why do I avoid Howard? George, why do I avoid...
Hey, listen to that deep voice on him.
Yeah, he's changed. He grew up.
Howard. No, honestly.
I never avoided Howard.
No. He's tried to get in touch with you and staying alive and stuff. Come on.
Okay, you know what? The truth is that I would love to do Howard's show, and he should call me about this, and we'll do it in December.
Okay, let me ask you something.
Go ahead.
I'm
waiting. I can wait.
Why don't you do John Hughes movies anymore?
Because he's a scumb.
What do you mean?
Just what I said.
How is he a scumb?
Well, he is. Just trust that.
No, please elaborate. This could be
no,
like...
No, I don't.
All right. I'm not going to...
Should have pushed him on that.
I do.
Oh, you do?
I keep on going, yeah.
It's just John Hughes is a... I think John Hughes made his career.
Apparently something must have happened.
Yeah, but even if something happened, at least he gave him a career.
I think he shunned him after he...
Yeah, but so what? Listen, he grew up. He's interested in teenagers, John Hughes. Right, Robin?
Yes, apparently so. Younger kids now with Macaulay Culkin.
Right. But you think John Hughes, like, hangs out at high schools or something and just listens to what kids say?
Well, he claims that he just hangs out around his house.
Really?
But I don't know.
That guy's awesome. He really is awesome. One movie after another. Even the ones I think stink make money.
Well, he's made some clunkers, but...
Yeah, pretty few.
Good run.
Yeah. Which issue, buddy?
I don't want to sue me or anything.
All right. Okay, well...
Did it happen? What do you think?
Did it do anything, like, financially
bad? Is there a lawsuit here?
No,
I don't want to get into any further. I told you the deal already.
Okay, all right.
That's it.
Have you ever...
Now everyone's doing it.
Yeah, everyone's into it.
Oh, no.
Audio mic spoken.
Have you ever dated Molly Ringwald?
Yes.
And getting hashish?
No.
Any
what?
Well, you know, that's between me and Molly, you know. We can't really disclose that here.
You have dated her?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
Lovely girl. Very moody, but very sexual.
You can...
That's all I got to say.
Okay. All right.
Thank you.
Are you sorry you ever did Saturday Night Live?
Hated it. No, I loved it. It was a great show. I mean, I did it because they asked me to do it, and that was a simple reason why I did it.
Really?
Yeah.
Did you have fun on it?
I love the show.
Okay, let me ask you. Who helped Johnny Depp urinate when he was wearing the makeup, right? Which is
he had a whole crew. He had a crew of men.
The question was, who helped Johnny Depp urinate when he was wearing the makeup for Edward Scissorhands?
Yes.
Thought that was a good one.
Crew of men. One crew. That was it. He had a special suit, and it's between him and his crew.
I'd actually be curious to know that. I mean, when you're in that stuff, can you get it off so you can go to the bathroom? Or do you have to have a guy hold it?
Oh, I'm sure they could rip those hands off.
Oh, yeah? Head. Think so? That looked pretty involved.
So, is Molly, is she red all over, or what?
Red all over?
Yes.
Come on. Thanks, Ed. Thanks a lot.
All right, good interview.
Thanks.
So he did Molly Ringwald?
I
was red all over.
So, yeah.
Yeah. Found out a lot. How was Mary Tyler Moore toward you?
They were all nice.
Really?
They were having fun.
Really?
Yeah, they didn't have a problem with anything.
Hmm. See, I kind of lightened up the questions a little bit because he was getting thrown out of every place.
Yeah.
Maybe I lightened him up too much.
I don't know.
Lee Iacocca.
Yeah.
And I was just setting up, ask him, I didn't have anything for him.
Yeah, I don't recall you talking to me about Lee Iacocca.
It's pretty strange. I asked him a normal question and he got mad at me.
All right.
Hi, Mary.
Hi.
This is the Howard Stern Show Total Broadcast. How are you?
Hi, fine. Thanks. How are you?
All right. Congratulations on your career. Big fan.
Thank you. Congratulations on yours.
How you doing?
Okay.
Let me just ask you, what are you sleeping?
A bed.
A bed. Okay.
How do you? When you ask her what are you sleeping, she says a bed. You say, no. What attire do you wear?
Okay.
You could follow up.
I didn't really know what you were getting at with that question.
We want to know what she wears to bed.
Okay.
That's all. First, an easy question, you know.
Okay.
You understand. You probe, you moron.
What are the charges by the inquiry that you had breast implants?
Well, if this is the best that an implant doctor could do, I want my money back.
Let me ask you, did Grant Sinker ever mention to you that he was responsible for the firing of Howard Stern?
Yeah.
Why? I don't know. It's just, I don't know why.
Why does that? You don't know anything about it. So why did you bring it up?
I'm just asking. Do you think that Murphy Brown is a ripoff of the old Mary Tyler Moore Show?
I think it borrows heavily from it, but I think.
But she's handling every question like a pro.
Yeah.
Those are some pretty heavy questions. So those aren't breast implants. The Inquirer says she got help.
I think I should ask if she still used tampons.
Yeah, that would have been nice. That would have been real good. She says that it sounds familiar that Grant Tinker might have been responsible for firing me, but she's not real sure.
Right.
I hung out with Mark Tinker after this whole thing, and he was telling me that they're all big fans of yours.
Yeah, great. That's really great.
Yeah, we've heard that from Mark Tinker before.
Yeah. It's great that he's a big fan. His father fired me. I see you're responsible for the sins of your parents. I got no interest in Mark Tinker. Mark Tinker, Mark Tinker's got a rich father. It's pretty easy to get a TV development deal when your father's the head of NBC and he's got his own production company. I'm not interested in guys like him. You know?
Sorry for bringing
I'd
it up.
Like to take Grant Tinker and beat his feet. What do you think of that? Mr. Wise-ass quality entertainment. We're not all of us can produce the Mary Tyler Moore Show. Genius. Embarrassed me. Almost ruined me. Oh. I rose from the grave. They had me down, Robin, but not out.
That's right.
Grant Tinker.
They'll take a bigger man than that.
No wonder Dick Van Dyke drank. Had to work with Grant Tinker, didn't he? Well, let me take a break here. Who's next? Is that it for Mary Tyler?
No, I think we're still going.
It's a laudable show.
Do you really?
Yes.
Would you ever convert to Judaism?
No.
Never?
No. I don't. I find it very difficult for me to follow organized religion of any kind.
Have you ever seen Ed Asner's hairy back?
No. Does he have one?
Yeah. Okay. Thanks a lot, Mary.
Okay.
Thanks.
Wow.
Congratulations.
Very nice.
Would you ever convert to Judaism?
Judaism.
Judaism. All right, 839-923-KROQ-WYSPWJFK. Even Valerie Harper talked to you, huh?
She couldn't stop talking.
Really? She was happy to see you.
Oh, she was rapping.
Yeah. Let's take a break. We'll wrap up the rest of these interviews. Oh, you interviewed that blind guy, Tom Sullivan?
That's the best.
Oh, yeah?
That's funny, man.
Did you ask him if his favorite color was corduroy?
Oh, no, but I asked him. You had all those good questions about that.
All right.
94 SP, Howard Stern all morning, classic rock and roll all day.
Okay, so it's not like you're going to overcharge the one person who pays. This is a really inexpensive vacation, and I'm talking about a great vacation with renovated guest rooms, spectacular mile-long coral beach, breathtaking gardens to stroll in, and seven lighted tennis courts. So it's two for one. Call your travel professional. Why don't you call this number, 1-800-223-6388. And just get all the details for the Double Your Pleasure Package. Say Double Your Pleasure Package when you call 1-800-223-6388. Marriott Sam Lord Resort, a Barbados resort. Call now. 847, Robin, 923-K-Rock. WISP, WJFK, your pal Howard here. Stuttering John quickly, let's go through the rest of these. We have news to get to, and we haven't taken one phone call, and we haven't even spun the wheel in Los Angeles yet.
You're holding us up, John.
Yeah, John.
Sorry, man.
All right, here we go. Valerie Harper. 3 minutes.
Hi. Hi, how are you?
Hello, good to see you, my dear.
This is the Howard Stern Show tape for broadcast. How are you?
All right, good.
Let me ask you.
I was just yelling at John that his microphone technique stinks.
I always hear the rattling of the papers.
Because he keeps the mic near himself, and he doesn't know how to put the mic in front of the celebrity's face. So you hear the audience, you hear whoever the crowd of people are around. You have the worst microphone technique. Would you practice? You want to practice with me? Interview me and hold a microphone.
It's never been this bad. I'm telling you, it's never been this bad.
You know what I want to do? I want you to interview me.
I know how to do it. I've been doing it.
You're not doing it right.
It just must have been something.
I can barely hear Valerie Harper, and yet the microphone is close to
her. They talk very low.
And no, they don't.
Did you ever get Jungle Fever?
I don't know what it is.
You never heard of Jungle Fever?
I heard of the movie. Warren Espress, malaria, but what do you mean by Jungle Fever?
Oh, I don't know. Do you believe the reports from the Inquirer that Mary...
So why did you go off on that?
Don't worry, but she comes back.
She does?
Yeah, well, here we go.
All right. Do you believe the reports, what, in the Inquirer? Is that what you're saying now?
No.
Oh, okay.
Can I answer me?
You know, like black and white, you know, you get a black eye.
Have I ever dated a black person, guy?
So you got
Jungle
Fever?
Yeah, I guess you could call it that.
Let me ask you, do you believe the reports from the...
How's she look, by the way?
She looks good.
Yeah?
Yeah, I mean...
She's still skinny, or...
Yeah, their bodies are intact, but, yeah, they get a little old up there.
Yeah.
Their bodies are intact?
Yeah, they're... No,
they're like mummies. They're wrapped in bandages, and they're intact. I met her when I went out to replace Joan Rivers.
Right, I remember that.
Yeah. She was on that night. Fox wanted me to replace Joan Rivers. I said, no, I'm too busy. That's so cool, huh? That I said that?
Yeah.
Yeah, a lot of good it did me.
Only thing that would be called Jungle. I think that's a little racist.
That was Spike Lee. That's not us. That's Spike Lee.
No, it isn't.
I'm telling you.
No, Spike Lee saying something else.
No, Spike Lee.
Yes, you are. You say something else. Next question.
Okay. Do you believe the reports from the Inquirer that Mary Tyler Moore had breast implants?
No.
So they've been saying?
I know, but they say all kinds of crap.
I know.
They say unbelievable crap about me. So, I believe very little I say about her.
I wonder what they say about her.
Yeah, I'd like to know.
I haven't read anything on her.
Did you get breast implants?
No. Never.
Look at this in this interview.
And she hasn't said thank you very much goodbye yet.
No, she's digging him.
She's rapping, man. She doesn't.
You can't believe your good luck. You realize the microphone is supposed to be near her face,
right,
but I hear
she's
the crowd.
Yelling
yeah, but she's
the
moving around and
so
stuff.
Keep it on her.
You know, I don't want to hit her with it.
But no, I think it's terrible. For one thing, they block mammography. They really do.
And see that?
Exactly.
Whoa.
And I don't know if Stone cares about that, but I do.
Look, let me ask you, were you ever spanked by your husband?
No. What was the answer to that? No.
Yeah, she starts elaborating on that, too.
She was never spanked. And she didn't walk away.
No, she kept going.
Were you ever spanked by your husband? There's a guy with long hair who appears to be stuttering and maybe looks like he's on drugs.
Yeah. And, you know, with these questions, don't you start to begin to think that this is a goof? The guy broke into the party and is pretending to be a
reporter? She's a very nice woman.
Well, I had my head slicked back.
I got a feeling she might have been at the party and no one was talking to her, so she was figuring
out. No, everybody was. ET was there, yeah.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
All right.
They treat us so good there. It's on, L.A. is, you know, it's great.
Well, no. Okay. That, the marriage would be over.
Why do you ignore Howard Stern?
Ignore him?
Yeah, because he's been trying to have you on. You know, he's a big fan.
He's never called me.
Would you come on the show?
Howard Stern. Like, I don't know. You have to call and tell me what you want me to do and so forth.
Oh, let's stream up. I know what I want to do.
That's the rambling again.
That's great.
As a matter of fact,
well, she says she would do it. But she would. You see, they have agents and stuff. They,
yeah, she says yes to everything. Yeah. The agents say no.
Right.
I'm not seeing the show. I saw a show about the show.
Uh-huh.
Recently, wasn't there something with
Howard?
What was it? Was it
David Letterman?
Maybe. It was talking about his show. It was kind of a news report. Or,
oh, really? I don't know.
Or a documentary.
I don't know.
But I really have never seen the show. When are you guys on?
We're on tonight at 12 o'clock.
Midnight?
Yeah.
See, I have an 8-year-old, and I'm a PTA mother now.
No.
So I get up at 6 to work out before I have to take her to school. But I shouldn't watch it tonight.
Yeah, that's right. You'll see me on it.
Oh, what do you do? What do you do?
I do this.
Oh, you do this. You do these.
They call me Stuttering John.
Stuttering John.
No,
boy, you guys are really hitting it off.
Man, I think you could have gotten a date.
I'm fascinated.
She's hanging. Then after this interview, she keeps walking around. Hey,
it's Stuttering John. What's that noise? What is there? A fire in
See,
there?
See, I don't know, man. I don't know what's going on.
Why can't I get a tape recorder? Maybe you shouldn't leave the tape recorder in people's rooms and get into fights around the tape recorder.
But
something.
Isn't that his papers with the questions on it?
I don't know what's going on.
You got to understand, there's a whole bunch of crews like and people around, too, you know, trying to, like, get her, too. And there's Mike.
I see.
Come on.
Right, you know, other reporters manage to get into a sticky situation like this and not have all this noise.
Let me go to Lee Iacocca. I want to hear him blow you off. Anything else happen with
Tom? Tom Sullivan you'd want to hear.
Yeah, damn. Well, that's after Lee Iacocca.
Oh, okay.
Because this is short.
It's short. All right.
Boy, Valerie Harper really went on for a while. I'm fast-forwarding now for an hour. It's a little quieter during Lee Iacocca.
What are you guys doing all these pictures?
Hey, Lee, can I ask a question, please?
Hi.
My name's Don from the Howard Stern Show. What do you think of Howard Stern?
I don't know Howard Stern.
No?
I know of him, but I...
Are you going to run for the presidency?
Are you kidding? Get out of here.
No? Are you
too late? Too late to do that.
That was it.
Boy, it's so noisy.
See, it's not, I'm telling you, it's because it's a big
wall.
No,
you're not doing it right.
Come on.
He's not doing it right, Rob.
No, he's not close enough to the person.
He's not.
I don't know. I think he's got
What happened to Lee Iacocca? I couldn't even hear what you said to him.
I asked him if he's going to run for the presidency again. He goes, And he goes, you couldn't get the hell out of here.
For the presidency.
I was gonna follow it up with, are you a Jew?
All right, I kind of heard that.
Yeah, he didn't. Thank goodness.
So is he gonna run for the
presidency?
You need someone to hold the microphone. You need a person with a brain to assist you. I'm telling you, man, no one can hear what you're doing.
Boy,
sorry.
I'm telling you, it is because of the.
Place. Right, let me hear Tom Sullivan, the blind guy. You want to hear that, Robin?
Yeah.
He's a guy who's blind, but he can do anything.
Howard Stern Show.
He's blind actor.
For our broadcast.
You see him in a lot of stuff.
How's it going?
I'm wonderful. Thank you.
Let me ask you, are you blind or is that an act?
Listen, I'll tell you the truth. I think Stevie's got an act. I think Ray's got an act. Mine is, it's about time. I'm actually not blind. I'm actually deaf. I've gone through this process basically because...
I can't even hear anybody.
I know. We're sitting here trying to listen to him. We can't hear him.
All right, let's thank Stuttering John.
I'm telling you.
You did a great job.
The mic is right in his face.
You did a great job.
Your mic technique is great.
I'll practice with you.
We'll see.
Interview me. Do me a favor, just so I can see. I know the people at home can't see this. Do me a favor. Hold the, you don't need an actual mic. Hold the stapler.
Okay.
All right? And staple your fingers together. Oh. Now, pretend this is a microphone.
Okay. Are you a Jew?
Yes, I'm a Jew.
Half Jew.
See?
Do you smoke pot?
No. All right, very good.
Are you going to come see Stuttering John at Dick Lee's this Saturday in Philadelphia?
No. Take a stapler and staple your mouth shut. There's something wrong with you. You got a nice interview going there, and I can't
well, hopefully,
hear it.
Hopefully.
There's always something wrong lately, isn't there?
Oh, come on.
There's always a problem.
Yeah.
Right, Robin?
Absolutely, every time.
How could you say that?
Why don't you, you know what, I'm going to, Robin, if you don't mind, I would like you to tutor him in microphone technique.
Can I ask you a question?
You were a reporter for
yes.
many years.
Yes.
I would like you to give him a course in how to hold the microphone and how to interview.
Okay.
All right, would you do that for me?
I will certainly
you
do
will.
That. You will? Yes.
You do not mind doing
I
that.
I don't
can
mind.
Can I ask you a question?
When can he schedule an appointment with you?
Thursday.
All right, Thursday.
Can I ask you a question?
Thursday after the show?
Yes.
All right, Thursday after the show, you have an appointment with Robin.
I'll go, but look, wait,
she's going to work on you.
Wait.
Thursday, I want you to interview Robin, and I want to hear the interview.
Okay, but listen.
And I want you to interview her. This is for your
We'll go outside.
For your regents. All right, for your regents examination, you're going to go outside in a crowded area and interview Robin.
Okay, let me ask you one question. The Bon Jovi stuff came out great. All the duff.
All right, thank you.
See, because
but listen, all I know is I can't hear anything.
The environment was bad out there, I'm telling you.
We will be back right after these words.
94 WISP Philadelphia. Classic rock and roll all day.
I guarantee you, once the season starts, there's not going to be any sales around. The only time that these stores have to move inventory is before the season or after the season. Now there are millions of dollars worth of inventory on sale at Princeton Ski Shops. And I mean enormous inventory. Ski clothing, equipment, big names, all that stuff. Lowest sale prices ever guaranteed or your money back. Here is the number for more information. 1-800-ALL-SKIS. 1-800-ALL-SKIS. All skis. Call doesn't cost you anything. Why don't you find out about this? Sale ends 10 p.m. Monday, Columbus Day. Locations, Roslyn, Long Island at exit 37 on the Long Island Expressway. On Route 9A North in Elmsford in New York. On Route 3 West in Clifton, New Jersey. That's Princeton. It's Princeton Ski Shops. Thank you. We're back. We're doing the news for you now.
That's right, Howard. And you know, the big news is, of course, that Judge Clarence Thomas is due to be voted on by the full Senate today.
What do you think will happen, Robin?
Well, that's the big question. People were hoping that they could delay this vote until a further investigation into allegations that he sexually harassed one of his employees could be pursued further. But since that hasn't happened, yesterday this woman held a press conference, this Anita Hill.
Yeah.
And people are saying they are hoping that because she was such a credible person and seemed to be telling the truth, that she will hopefully sway some votes against Judge Thomas. But that's the final hope, because if they vote his confirmation and he's approved, that's it. He gets the job for life.
Did they ask her? Did they ask her why a man who had sexually harassed her, why she had called him to speak at her, whatever that was?
Some to her class in the college, I think.
Yeah. Why did she do that? Did they ask her that?
Well, she says that she thought he was a good lawyer.
So, even though this guy sexually harassed her, she was willing to... I don't know. It just seems
See,
weird.
See, I don't understand it either.
Yeah.
And that really was not addressed in the press conference.
Yeah.
They basically just asked her why she was coming out at this time. So, here's what she has to say about that.
Nothing could be further from the truth. There is absolutely no basis for that allegation, that I am somehow involved in some political plan to undermine the nominee.
But wouldn't you distance yourself from a man who was after you?
I would. See, my whole deal would be, well, you know, I don't need to be here anyway.
It's just kind of weird. I mean, she's saying it's nothing personal, but she's wrecking his life, but it's nothing personal.
And then she says that she didn't come forward herself, that she wouldn't have made these allegations until the FBI came to question her. Somehow they wound up on her doorstep. So I don't understand anything that's going on. You know, you think, well, we're dealing with a couple of lawyers here. She even graduated from Yale. It's not like she's a slouch.
Yeah, she's no stupid idiot.
But this doesn't make any sense. What else does she have to say?
My integrity has been called into question, and by people who have never spoken to me, that have not considered the facts carefully, as far as I know.
Well, she really has no motive, I guess. I don't know, but maybe she does. Who knows if she has an axe to grind? I mean,
Well, the one interesting thing is...
Let me back you up for a second. You're saying the FBI came to her door and said, we're doing a check of this guy, and since you know him, you have anything to say to us?
Yes, that's right. what she contends, that she did not call anyone. She had decided she was going to bury this thing. She didn't talk about it. But when they came to her, she said, as a citizen with some knowledge of a person who's going to be sitting on the Supreme Court...
Right, she figured she should say something.
She figured she should say something.
And what about the fact that she continued to associate with him even though he was harassing her? This is not a woman who needs to be with him.
Right. She continued to work for him at this one particular job, and then they somehow became separated for a while, and then he rehired her when he came to work at a new agency, and she says the harassment started again.
And what is her concept of harassment? What was it he was supposedly doing?
The first incident apparently occurred when he asked her for a date, I guess, couple of times.
I don't think there's anything wrong with that.
Wait a minute, yeah. I'm not done yet.
Go ahead.
And when, you know, she refused, I guess she turned him down a couple of times, and then while in her presence, he would start to talk about pornographic movies he had seen and discuss weird sexual preferences that sort of turned him on. She felt this was inappropriate. She didn't appreciate this conversation.
This is very strange.
See, this is why harassment, all of these kinds of claims are very...
difficult to prove.
Difficult to prove, that's right. Because you could say that you harass me every day. Jackie harassed me. Everybody in this office harasses me. But I don't care.
What about you?
It doesn't bother me when you guys say that stuff. I go, eh.
Well, you're kind of interested, too.
I'm sort of interested.
Yeah,
sometimes
we're interested
I'm
in the
not.
Conversation.
Isn't the question kind of
you
like,
leave the room if you're not interested. If we're talking about porno and you don't like it, you leave the room.
Yeah.
Like, so whole thing.
Although I've never seen you leave the room during porno discussion.
I'm trying.
Right. If the woman is in the whole discussion and then decides a year later, gee, I didn't like talking about that.
Right,
it's a different thing than don't talk about this in front of me. I'm not going to listen to it.
Did she say to him, don't talk about this in front
of
me?
They never
say
that.
She didn't feel that she had a right to. This was her boss, her superior. And I suppose that's where the problem arises, because this is your boss. How do you tell your boss to stop doing something?
But it wasn't like he was saying, hey, honey, I just watched a clip of some guy making it with animals, and man, I'd like to do that to you.
What difference does it make? If somebody comes, now me...
You mean to tell me the way a guy discusses stuff, that's harassment?
Let me say this.
Yeah.
If you don't know me very well...
Right.
And we have to work together, okay?
Yeah.
Somebody gives us a project to do together.
And I get you alone in a room and I start
going... And we're alone in a room, and all of a sudden you start telling me about some porn movie you just saw.
Yeah.
I don't know you.
Yeah, but you know, that's like, you know, my sister, you could tell her, hey, I just saw a picture of a penis. My sister would go, oh, you're kidding! You know, I mean, she gets like crazy over it.
Well, yeah, but that's what you should do. You shouldn't sit there and be uncomfortable.
And go the next time he asks you either.
I don't know
about not going the next time you ask, because you have to make a living.
My head is spinning from this. Let's move on.
See, that's the problem.
Go ahead.
But I have this happen to me constantly because I do this show. People often think it's all right to say just about anything to me.
And believe me, it is.
No, sure.
Go ahead, please.
No, I was going to say, sometimes I'm sitting in an editing room over at the TV station and some strange guy will say something to me, and I do. I go, what?
Yeah.
And he goes, oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to offend you. I thought I could say that. But, you should speak up.
Tell me what they say to you.
Darn it.
What did he say? What did the last guy say to you that offended you at the TV station? What did he say?
Oh, I don't know. We were cutting up a piece of tape or something, and he made some comment about a woman's breasts, you know, using very graphic words.
You didn't like that.
I don't like it from strangers. I don't know who this guy is. Who is he to talk to me like that?
Who's Fred to talk to you like that?
Well, I say that, too.
All right, go ahead, Robin.
So anyway, Judge Thomas will be voted on today. And
my prediction, you want it?
Go ahead.
He will be confirmed.
All right.
Go ahead.
Let's see. Leo DeRocher is dead. Now, I know that means a lot to you, Howard, because you were a big fan.
Robin saw me read that headline on the newspaper. I go, who cares? Leo DeRocher, it means nothing to me.
Apparently, you know, this is the one thing I would like to have attributed to me one day. He coined a phrase.
Collector's item, right? Oh, that was Joe Franklin. What was the phrase?
Nice guys finish last.
Right. I thought Jackie coined that.
No, that wasn't one of Jackie's.
That's my life.
But I didn't, you know, he actually coined a phrase. That's a wonderful thing.
Well, Leo DeRocher or not, Clarence Thomas, my prediction, will bang everybody in Washington. What do you think of that? Hey, imagine Sandra Day O'Connor's all excited. They're going to nominate a big, I mean, they're going to accept a big black man who likes to talk about dirty movies.
Yeah, they can get together
I like
have
that.
A good time.
That would be exciting.
Well, DeRocher died in his sleep, Howard. He was 86 years old. So I guess it was just old age that took him away.
That's the best way to go, right in your sleep.
Yeah, I'd like to go that way. I don't want a long, protracted illness.
There you go. Sayonara.
He managed the New York Giants in 1951, the year of the miracle of Coogan's Bluff, whatever that is.
Yeah.
There's, you know, these terms that they use in sports.
There's like sports
guys
now.
Amazing. Yeah, I'm sure a lot of guys are very upset because this guy was one of those legendary managers. And they used to call him Leo the Lip because of the fights he'd get into with the umpires on the field. So anyway, here's a couple of clips of Leo DeRocher for those of you who are going to miss
This is him talking. Will he be saying the phrase, nice guys finish last?
No.
Oh. Because that's the phrase he coined. I coined the phrase once.
What was it?
Channel 9 sucks. And a lot of people credit me with that. You know that. You hear him saying it all in the halls when we're over there.
You hear that all the time.
But I started it. Channel 9 sucks. So I want that on my epitaph. All right, here we go. Leo DeRocher speaking. This is a dead guy. This guy's now dead. You're going to be listening to a voice of a guy who formerly was alive.
You could walk up to an umpire and use a little language, right? And you could call him a little, and then he'd finally look at you and say, that's far enough. But now you can't, you got to be very careful what you say. You don't have to use any obscene or profane language anymore. And you're gone.
What's up, Doc?
I don't even know one word he said. I don't know what he just said. I see you got another tape, but I won't know what he said.
You won't know what he said. He was talking there about how you can't say the things he used to say when he'd walk out to the umpire. He used to, I guess, curse him out quite a little bit.
You better set the next one up if you're going to do it.
And the last one, I think, is about the games or the season he'll remember most.
1954, when we won the pennant and beat a club that won more games than anybody in the history of the game, Cleveland, 111, and we beat them four straight in the World Series.
Leo the Lip.
There he goes. Goodbye, funny man.
So long. 86, right in his sleep. That's the best way to go.
Yeah, he must have been a good guy. He was married like four times or something.
No.
Never was able to make that work.
Because he was Leo the Lip.
Guess his wives didn't appreciate that. Did you see what
that rough exterior wasn't exactly their idea, the perfect man, I guess.
Did you see what they did to Wayne Newton's award from NBC? Here the guy goes, he sues NBC because they claimed in some news piece they did that he had mafia ties, and
right.
It caused him a lot of trouble. So he went to the trouble of suing them. They went before a jury, and the jury said, yes, he was maligned, and there was malicious intent, and we award him $5.27 million.
Excuse me, they awarded him $19 million.
Was it $19
million? $19
million. Because I know there was a lot of money involved.
And then the court said, wait a second. You're doing this trial in Las Vegas. They love Wayne Newton there. That's
oh,
when
is
they
that what they said?
That's when they reduced it to $5
million. Uh-huh.
And then NBC appealed. And now they took away everything.
Yeah, well, it was, you know, another appeals court got a hold of it and said, you don't get anything, even though, it looks like you, you know, suffered some damage here. And so he went to the Supreme Court.
Yeah.
And yesterday the Supreme Court said, we don't have time to be bothered with you. You don't need money. Get out of here. So that's the end of his case.
Wow. He must have spent a fortune, too.
I'm just telling you. And NBC sitting there laughing. It's a shame.
Quite frankly, I'm happy about it.
Why?
I don't know. Who needs Wayne Newton getting more money? I think he's got way too much money as it is.
Well, you know, the only reason
I'm with the Supreme Court.
I wanted him to win was because it was NBC.
Well, yeah, I guess, but I don't know.
They also rejected an appeal by a New York Railroad police officer, Richard DeClara of Queens, who was fired after a videotape showed him nearly nude and making fun of homeless black men while patrolling Grand Central Station.
Wait, this is a cop?
Yeah.
He was nude and making fun of homeless people? He stripped it and he videotaped it?
Yeah.
Well, I remember that.
Videotape. You remember that whole hubbub. Yeah, well, I guess he was trying to get his job back. And the high court said, we can't entertain this either.
You were nude. On the job.
So he's going to have to look for something else to do, I suppose.
Hey, Fred's job is open.
David Brenner is still in the news.
Yeah.
He will be going back to court today where he will seek a civil and criminal contempt citation against his old girlfriend, Charisse Brody, for allegedly hiding their child, Cole, in defiance of a judge's court order of temporary custody to David Brenner.
This is all nonsense. You know, when the court makes an order and says, you know, you have to turn over your child, you don't do it. They should take her and throw her in the clink. What she's doing is wrong. But you know what it is? If you ignore a court order nowadays, you get away with it. Do whatever you want.
You can just sort of run around and do whatever you want?
Yeah, and then they'll say, okay, she was a distraught mother. That's what you see. This all goes, this ties back to all these women who kill their husbands in their sleep, light the fire on the bed and everything. We now allow things. You're allowed to do a lot of things that you weren't formerly allowed to do.
Mm.
If there were strict laws in this country, people wouldn't do anything. But now there's always a reason. I killed this guy because I had multiple personalities.
Extenuating circumstances.
Right. Can you imagine they let people off because they got they put them in a mental institution because they claim they have multiple personalities. All I know is somewhere in there's a personality that's capable of killing. I say that's one too many.
Lock them all up. Yeah. They all got to go.
All personalities
suffer. One murderer in there.
It's all the same personality. So this one's claimed. Listen, we all have multiple personalities. Sometimes we're nice to people. Sometimes, you know, it depends how much we eat in that day and how much sleep we got. Today, the nice Howard is with you. Tomorrow, the angry Howard could be with you. There's all kind of Howards.
But there's not a murderous Howard, is there?
There's not. And if there ever was one, lock up my whole body. Lock up every personality inside of me.
Yeah, not just on certain days.
There isn't a person in this country who doesn't have multiple personalities. You know, I meet people sometimes, they go, boy, you're not so bad. Then 2 hours later, they go, you're pretty bad. Well, the immature Howard.
Well, I
call him Dave.
Oh, stop it.
You know, what is that?
I was going to say, I must suffer from this syndrome because I have blackouts. People tell me I'm not so nice.
Right.
And I don't remember these things.
That's right. You have another personality inside of you.
Somehow I must leave and someone else takes over.
You have to name her bitch, that one. Well, that's
so anyway,
the bitch in me.
David will be, Cole's son will be, his picture will be shown on Joan Rivers' show every day.
Every day?
Until he is returned.
Boy,
yes.
Joan and David Brenner really making up.
Yeah. So I thought that was interesting.
She's going to return the
it's
kid.
Like Charisse has to, tunes into the Joan Rivers show every day, or whoever's around Charisse or Joan Rivers watchers.
I think the people around Charisse know exactly what the kid looks like. I think there's a lot of missing kids, actually, that really could use their picture shown on Joan Rivers every day.
But it's David Brenner's son who will be shown.
But, you know, just think a few short years ago, they weren't talking to one another for the stupidest reason.
Yeah.
Because David Brenner, Joan Rivers left Johnny Carson in bad terms because she went and took another job. So David Brenner sided with Johnny Carson, like someone was asking him to.
Right, there wasn't even a there wasn't a fight to get into, and David jumped in.
What was that, David?
Joan is totally drunk. She's not online.
All right, because Johnny gave you your break on the Tonight Show.
You bet.
So
anything
that's what. What?
Anything for Ed.
Anything for Ed and Johnny. But now you're good friends with Joan.
Hello.
What?
Hello, yeah, I'm friends with Joan.
Because I don't think Johnny's showing your son's picture.
Where's my kid? I think I got a date tonight.
Also in the news, Howard, Dale, tell me how you feel about this. A Denver City worker who took time off from her job at a hospital to care for her injured lesbian lover is entitled to sick leave.
Oh, boy. Unbelievable.
Like,
you know what's happening? People cannot run a business anymore. Where does she work?
Well, she works for the city of Denver.
Oh. The city of Denver is the only place they would allow that to go on. And the city of New York, any of these cities. We allowed municipal workers to unionize. City workers. Now, I'm going to tell you what's wrong with that. That happened, I think, during Lindsay or Beam. I don't know when that happened. But if you decide that you want to serve the public, if you want to be a public servant, there isn't much job security with that. Your job is dependent on the economy doing well. If the people of New York can't pay out that many taxes, after a while they start to bleed, you have to cut back. It's like any business, Robin. If you ran a business and times were bad, you'd have to fire 10 people. Mm-hmm. And you wouldn't want to do it. You love them all, but you'd have to let go of 10 people. The same thing with the city of New York or the city of Denver. You would create certain rules. Things were good. We'd be able to hire more people, more services. When things are bad, you cut back. Now we have unions. For some reason, we allowed them to unionize. How can you unionize if you're serving the city? Go into the private sector if you want to make more money, if you want to have free enterprise.
Mm-hmm.
You're working for the city. Taxpayers are paying you. So how can you hold up taxpayers and say, I need time off for my lesbian lover? Now, in business, you know what they would do to you? They would say to you, listen, we love you. We love your lesbian love. We love that thing. But listen, do you want to come to work or not? You want to come to work? You want time off? You got to show up for your job.
I got to know if you're going to be here.
Right. City workers, they don't care. They let them do anything. Nobody watches them. Nobody's watching them. I would watch them. Everything is so simple to me.
Well, you know what this is all about, though? They must have a rule that says if an immediate family member gets severely ill,
yeah,
you can take time off from your job with pay.
Oh, boy. That's
to
some...
take care of them.
Now, who granted that wish?
Well, that's what happens when you get a union. You know that.
So now they're saying, okay, so anybody who's got a lesbian thing going on, now they can take time off. Who is paying for all these days off? I say take all the days off you want. But resign. There's not an industry that will allow this. Listen, you got sick days. Everybody gets 5 sick days a year. You want to take your sick days and take care of someone else? Go ahead. No one's going to ask any questions. It's fine.
For a little vacation time, you got that too.
Yeah. That nobody's giving up. Now they got a vacation day for someone else who's sick. Isn't that beautiful? Only a city worker would get that. I bet you at Infinity I wouldn't get that. Excuse me. My father is dying. Do you think I could have a few days off? Now, I happen to know what they say to you here. They're compassionate. They give you 3 days. You want a week? You kiss my black ass.
Well, this woman wanted 3 days of paid sick leave because her girlfriend was
First
all
of
broken
all,
up.
What's the matter with her? She has to go tell him because the girlfriend... Just take your sick leave. If you got 3 days of sick leave, take. I got a feeling that she... Maybe all her sick days were already taken up. She wanted an additional 3 days? If it was 3 days she was entitled, just take your sick leave. We don't care why.
Well, they weren't going to give her sick leave because she wasn't sick. But she said, but, you know, my immediate family member. They said, oh, your husband? No. My girlfriend.
Oh, my God. This country is ruined. In Japan, the nips never get off for a sick relative. And that's why they're beating us. They're beating us over the head with our own technology.
So,
I work for a company. I don't get Columbus Day off. And that poor bastard found this country.
They have decided that regardless of your sexual orientation, you should be allowed to stay at home with a member of immediate family.
That's
and decided
great.
Her girlfriend was immediate family.
My dog has rabies. I'll be back in January. Good night, everybody. I got to leave right now, Robin. Maybe soon for dogs. If you're and my horse is sick. I have a horse. I got a stable. I go there a couple of days a week. I got to be with the horse.
My horse is in foal.
What's the matter? You're not for animal rights? You know, that's what they'll claim next. There is no such thing as being an employer anymore and employer's rights. And certainly when it comes to the city, there's not one bum in political office that sits and makes us think about this. Because they're all a bunch of pussies and they're afraid of not being reelected. Now, the day I walk in and tell you my gerbil needs a bath and I have to go home early is the day you can take me out of my job because there's something wrong with me. My lesbian lover is sick. Are you sick? I'll tell you what you do. You come to work and you pay some kid to sit there with your lesbian lover. Are you a doctor? Are you going to get her better? Leave her some food in a dish.
Oh.
Or send her to the vet. Can you imagine this? Just take your sick days. And if you're taking up all your sick days, there's something wrong with you. Shouldn't be that sick. Thank you. All right. We'll take a break. I'll come back and analyze the rest of your news there.
All right.
You know what I'm talking about. You know full well what I'm talking about. The private sector.
This is a question. This is a big question.
I can't foot the bill for every shrub scout who wants to go home and be with a girlfriend. I can't foot the bill.
But, you know, then maybe we shouldn't have those rules for anyone.
You bet. Make it like the private sector.
That's right. How about...
I'll go tell Tom Trisano I got to go take care of my wife.
Who's sick at home? Right. Get him a nurse.
Yeah. What are you going to do for your wife? That's what he'd ask me. Oh, you want to take care of your wife? Go ahead. We'll go get another morning guy.
I hope your wife pays you as well as
I'm
me.
I'm entitled. Just. Right. I'm telling you. It's insane. Some of those rules. Even for heterosexuals to get that rule in city work is ridiculous.
Yes, but see, that's what happens. There is a rule like that.
Right. Now everybody's
so now the gays want it.
So you think, what about the dog lovers? You think dog lovers should have a few days off?
You know, I had a sick dog once, and I wanted to stay home
with
it.
Right. You should do that. Go ahead. You know, Jackie, I got to tend to his toes. Jackie's toes are being pulled out by the doctor because they're fungated. I need to stay with him. I can't talk. All right. Go ahead, Fred. Play some commercials. We'll be right back.
This is
all this weekend at 94WI.
They charge you extra padding, stair work, delivery, installation. They figure out a way to jack up that price. At Giant Carpet, you know one thing. The padding is free. The custom stair work is free. Delivery is free. Even installation is free. And you're covered with a lifetime guarantee from a store you know that's going to be there. Giant Carpet. And Robin, they have Anso Crush Resistor Carpet. The high-performance Anso yarn.
Is that hard to find?
You know what it is? It's hard to find at a good price because it's in such demand. Anso is a very popular, especially Anso Crush Resistor. Because it literally looks good 5 years from now, 6 years from now. You know, it always, for the life of that carpet, it looks good. It always springs back. Now you step on some carpet and it's always matted. This is Anso yarn. Giant Carpet even has a high profit opportunity for a franchise business. If you're interested, call Giant Carpet. Why not call this number, 1-800-926-7942 for more information. Giant Carpet. So you're in Soap Opera Digest again. Did you see it?
No.
Man, are you in it. This is a big one. This is unbelievable.
What is this?
This guy's really getting a lot of attention from this.
Oh, God.
All right, listen to the headline, okay? It's a picture of Michael Swan with his black, the woman who's on the show with him.
Right,
who plays his love interest, Tamara. Yeah. But she's black.
Mm-hmm.
Black-white romance is no problem for me. How I handle it on and off screen by...
What?
By As the World Turns, Michael Swan. Handling an interracial... Care to hear more?
No, just stop right there.
No, you want to hear this.
I don't want to hear this.
Yes, you do. This is more important than any news story you got.
Oh, this is it. This is it.
Handling an interracial romance poses few headaches for As the World Turns, Michael Swan, either on or off screen. He's currently involved in a romantic plotline with his black lawyer, Jessica Tamara Tooney. And off-screen, Michael dates black radio and TV celebrity Robin Quivers of The Howard Stern Show. I'll skip down, okay?
No.
To your part. And your part's pretty big. I have an interracial relationship in real life. I date Robin Quivers, talk show celebrity, Howard Stern's co-host. We've had 5 or 6 dates. We enjoy each other's company. It's nothing hot or heavy. We're good friends, and that's it. People often ask if we get a lot of flack from our relationship. Who's making a big deal about this relationship?
I don't see a soul.
Her huge breasts and moist lap make me forget the color difference.
Oh, jeez!
No, she didn't say that. I said
Jackie
that.
Jackie is reacting like that could be real.
Yeah.
Oh, you wacko.
No, here it is. People often ask me if we get a lot of flack from our relationship. I'm delighted to answer, none whatsoever. Not that it doesn't exist in many other situations. What does that mean?
I don't know.
In other words, other people get flack.
How would I know what he's talking about?
Well, he's your man.
How would I
suppose I
know?
When you two have a quiet moment together, you discuss your interracial relationship. I also enjoy a close friendship with my co-star, Tamara. In fact, we're very close. Last Friday after work, we went out and had a couple of glasses of red wine together. We talked and had a good time. We've got a lot of respect for one another. That's the great thing about As the World Turns. There's a whole lot of mutual admiration going on. Everyone's very supportive of each other. We genuinely like each other. Man. Black-white romance is no problem for me. How I handle it on and off screen. by Michael Swan. Man. Her huge breasts and moist lap make me forget the color difference. Oh, man. Well, you're all over the place, Robin.
No, I'm not. I'm not anywhere.
I don't know. He's given a lot of interviews.
I'm not anywhere.
These articles by him.
That's him. I'm not anywhere. You don't see me doing interviews about this.
He's got to be banging you.
No, he says right there, nothing hot and heavy.
Hmm. Maybe he wants to be double-teamed by you and Tamara. Tamara Tooney. Hey, why don't they bring you into the soap opera, and you come on as his real-life girlfriend, and you two, you bang him.
Oh, now, that's a good storyline.
I like that. Man, oh, man, oh, Shevitz. See, I didn't realize that was the plot line on the show. It's interesting, life imitating art.
Or vice versa.
Yeah. Art imitating life. Would you do it if they wrote you in? Would you appear?
No.
You will not.
Oh.
You're turning it down now.
I'm turning it down now. Don't even start. Put your pencil down.
If me, Jackie, and Fred write a soap opera for you, we would appear in it? Your hot, moist lap. We'll write it in so you steal Michael Swan from Tamara Tooney.
No, thanks.
What's with this guy? He's doing, you know, for a guy who was supposedly trying to low-key it, he's doing a
lot. Right, yeah.
So you tell
that's
me.
That's enough.
Remember
already.
We talked about this?
Right.
I said, I don't know. This seems a little odd.
He should have told me. I think, you know, he told me he was going to have the cover of Soap Opera Diet. Yeah. But he told me it was about his storyline on the show.
Yeah. Oh, Michael, will it be on the show? Hey, this is my Robin. He's playing you like a fiddle. I don't sit idly by. I'll write a song about him if he doesn't watch it.
We'll do it anyway.
Yeah, right. I got a song. I'm going to play a song for you, too. Ready? Everybody, ready? This is for Robin and her
get
soap opera man.
Turntable.
Listen to the first line.
Get it all, Howard.
Wait, the first line, Robin.
She was black as the night.
Is.
Hey, that's the first line. Enough already.
I want to see if it. I want to see if it parallels here.
When you taste brown sugar, you fell in love overnight.
Which was a more annoying song, this or Kung Fu Fighting? This? I go with that. I don't know.
It.
If I played Kung Fu Fighting, you can make a good argument. Come on. I think it's a tie.
Nice. Play them together.
She was black as the night, and Louie was white. What's the second line?
Louie was whiter than white.
Louie was whiter than white. Who do we know that's whiter than white?
Fred.
Nah,
Jackie's whiter than me.
Jackie's got fungus. He's so white.
He's green. He's changing color.
Jackie was greener than green. His toes were falling off. And God knows what's happening to his schween.
Right. Enough already.
Bad, it was good.
It was good, see?
Louie had the best girl he could. When he took her home to meet his mama and papa.
Have you met his mom and papa?
No.
Thank God. Or else the song would be too eerie. All right, what else is in the news? Besides you.
No.
Besides you. I got something for you for the news.
What?
Backwards messages in the Guns N' Roses album.
Oh, yeah?
I got them.
Are they really there?
Yep. Gary heard them. Me and you will hear them for the first time together.
All right.
Ready?
Yeah.
Okay, this is forwards. Let me see. I got to get it set up. Give me a second. Let me set it up, okay, Robin?
Okay, what are you doing?
I'm getting the Guns N' Roses thing so you can hear it.
Is he up to something?
You know me. Trying to kill a couple hours. Right, hold on a second. Ready?
Go ahead.
You ready?
Forward or backward? What are you playing?
I'm going backward first.
Okay.
Listen carefully, ready?
Michael Schwann loves brown sugar.
Oh.
Michael Schwann. Michael Schwann loves brown sugar. Brown sugar.
See, did you hear anything?
Howard.
What did it sound like? It
sounded like Michael Schwann.
Loves brown sugar?
Somewhere.
That's what I heard.
Freddie, how come you can never hear any of these other backwards messages?
Yeah, how come all of a sudden Freddie can hear it? It's amazing, isn't it, that way?
Michael Schwann kisses and tells. Michael Schwann kisses and tells.
What song is that?
What?
It's on Guns N' Roses. Michael Schwann kisses and tells.
What track?
Bad Obsession.
I hope Robin Quivers isn't pregnant. I hope Robin Quivers isn't pregnant. I hope Robin Quivers isn't pregnant. You better not get yourself knocked up. You better not get yourself knocked up. Robin Quivers may be pregnant. Robin Quivers may be pregnant.
I'm hearing it. I'm telling
you. Stop spreading stupid rumors.
I'm hearing it. You wouldn't have his baby, though, would you?
Better please, not. I'm not having anyone's baby.
Banging Robin sounds more like a career move.
I don't know what's going on over there. I want to get this guy on the phone.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
Yes. You ready? Go ahead. I'd like to hear an explanation
yes,
of this.
I would, too.
I've been holding on to this number for weeks.
You have it?
Oh, yeah. Oh. We've had it 100 times. You never wanted to call it, but we're ready now.
Really?
Yeah.
I was waiting for Robin to get intense.
To what? What?
To this whole situation. What? I want to know what's going on.
I want to know, too.
Hold on with that, Spots. I'm in the middle of a news story.
I thought it was Guns N' Roses we were investigating now.
Oh, you want to hear Guns N' Roses seriously? All right, this is from the song. Let me take a break. I'll play the Guns N' Roses. We'll call your boyfriend, and we'll get back to more news.
I don't have a boyfriend.
Ex-boyfriend. First, these short words.
94 WYSP, Howard Stern all morning, classic rock and roll all day.
All they do is remove the fat and the water. And it's 4 calories a serving. And you know, let's say you have a baked potato or fish or noodles or steamed vegetables, rice, hot cereal soups. Sprinkle it on and you got the taste of butter.
And none of the calories are the fat.
And can be used as an ingredient in cooking and baking. So if you're doing a recipe and they call for a stick of butter, instead of a stick of butter, put butter but sprinkles in. And you got the taste of butter, same taste, and all of a sudden you have a low-calorie, no-cholesterol dessert or, you know, snack. Hey, for those of you listening, Gary uses Butter Buds, but it's not responsible for his, you know, green teeth. All right? That happened a long time ago before Butter Buds, right?
Right. It comes in a powder form, and it's great for baked potatoes. It's a perfect example. It's right. Use it for.
Sprinkle.
Sprinkle it right on it.
How dare you? Butter Buds sprinkles.
94 WISP, Howard Stern all morning, classic rock and roll all day.
You're having pizza, macaroni and cheese, and filet of sole, I don't know, meatloaf, pot roast with string beans and gravy.
Turkey, fish, pasta, pizza.
Want to lose 200 pounds, Robin?
No.
Dump your boyfriend there. Nutrisize now. Lose all the weight you can for the price of a 10-pound program. Food and evaluation fee not included at participating centers only. Call 1-800-321-THIN. Do it now. You're going to get thin. You're going to be able to fit into your pants. Visit their new center on Route 202/31, just south of the Circle in Flemington, New Jersey. Nutrisystem. They're great. Really works. We keep having thin people come in here, and they show me pictures. Man. They have reduced some people into...
Where are they today? They're usually here.
Well, but they're not here. They're not here today, right?
Who?
Nutrisystem.
I haven't seen them, though.
Good, because I got too much going on here. All right, first things first. You want to hear the Guns N' Roses thing? Gary won't tell me what they're saying. He wants to see if we hear it.
This is really true.
Yeah, swear to God. I'll play it to you forwards and then backwards, okay? Okay. All right. Then you're not going to tell me what we're supposed to be hearing.
No. You
can see if we hear anything.
All right, all right. Does it start right up?
You'll hear it.
Okay. I'm pissing you off.
No, listen to us. Right. Listen to us.
I hear I'm pissing
your,
you off.
What's wrong with your hearing?
What is it?
Listen to us. Love this band or something like that.
Really?
It's yeah. Listen to us, listen to us. You hear it clear in the...
I heard love this band.
Something hear, like that, maybe.
You hear it clear in the first verse.
Don't you think that's coincidence, though?
No.
You don't?
No.
Oh, come on. No, you be just saying no? Or...
I'm saying no, that's not coincidence.
You think they intentionally did that?
Yes.
They went to all that trouble?
Yes.
Come on.
How do I know it's all that trouble with the new technology?
Yeah, listen to us is really the only thing.
Yeah, listen to us is the only for sure thing there.
I wouldn't have gotten that, though. I would have sort
of... Who listens to these things backwards?
Yeah.
Where did you find this?
I stayed up all night playing
it. You know what it must be? Actually, it might be planned because they have to be the ones who release it. No one's going to sit and listen
sure,
backwards.
Right. Right.
Especially
that's
the two
I'm
albums
saying.
Of material. Yeah. And then all of a sudden they probably tell some kid and he calls a radio station.
Right, right, right.
I believe it's intentional.
It's a lot of effort. It's not even a cool message.
But that's what everybody said, you know, like when they had the trials against those other guys. Who were they?
Judas Priest.
Right. They said if we were going to put a subliminal message on, it'd be buy the album.
Right. Okay. Well, there it is. Let's see. Exclusive.
First time heard yes. anywhere.
All right. What are we doing next? We're still in the news, you know.
We're calling Michael Swan.
Who is, right.
Who is the news?
That seems to be the news. Call him. Get him on the line. Here, you got to do this, don't you? You getting anything?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Oh, man.
What?
Just old man.
Just thought you'd moan.
Just moan.
In general.
You know I moan now all the time.
Yeah, sort of just make noises all the time.
Is this all there is, Robin?
It's ringing.
Oh, okay. You might be at work. Don't they work early on those soap operas?
I don't know.
Stuttering gay sheesh entering the room.
Oh, answering machine's coming on.
Mm-hmm. Tell them to pick up.
And the beep is coming up.
It's like a presidential, sort of like a, after the assassination of Kennedy.
A message for Michael Swan. It's Gary from Howard Stern's office. Are you there, Mr. Swan? Can you pick up?
Mr. Swan.
Are you there?
Mr. Quivers calling.
Robin Quivers wanted me to get a hold of you.
And, well, Howard
listen
wants.
To this. Well, listen
he
to
doesn't
him.
Know how to leave a message.
He's a fool.
Give me that phone, you idiot.
Hold on.
Hang it up. I'll leave a message.
Robin Quivers wanted me to get a hold
well,
of you.
Well, we were trying to get him to pick up if he was there, and then I would have said...
Oh, I see. It was a theory.
Sure.
No, I'm serious.
I'll leave a message.
Sorry, listening to the classics.
I'm into Liberace, okay?
It's five rings, and then he does
five rings,
and then he does mention his phone number.
All right, I'll bleep that off.
Why? Just let it.
Yeah, right. Let it go. Probably he's probably busy on Regis and Kathy Lee showing pictures of your date.
Video.
Yeah, exclusive video. This is me and Robin at the party.
Hello, you've reached
9.
Please leave your name and your number, and I can. Thank you.
Okay. Hello, Michael. This here be the head potentate of the show, Howard Stern. I'm on the air. You're not. We are. Listen, I want to interview you. It's time you came on our show. Gary will line it up with you later. I want to hear your explanation. I will phone you tomorrow. I want to understand why you're printing articles in the Soap Opera Digest
and about you and Robin's relationship, and yet when I wanted to show your picture on my show, you're in a huff. Right, Robin?
No.
And because Robin doesn't understand it either. Because it's almost like you're an alley cat who went on a date with, what's his name? Donald Trump. You're the one writing about it. Allow me to talk about it as well.
Well, since you two are dating each other.
Right. Hey, what a recording on that answering machine. I'd make a new message. Hello. Please leave your number, especially if you're a black woman with a radio show.
And I can get some publicity out of it.
Right. I mean, come on. Anyway, we do want to talk with you tomorrow.
No, we don't. Not necessarily.
Oh, we don't?
Yes. Don't we want to... Jackie wants to talk.
Wants to talk to you.
Well, fine.
On the Jackie show.
Now Robert can't answer our phone between today and tomorrow.
Right. Yeah, you're not allowed. I want to know what is going on here. All right, thank you.
I thought the media blitz was over.
Yeah, Mr. Media Blitz.
That article was supposed to be about you and your soap opera co-star.
Right.
How does my name show up in it?
Yeah.
What's that all about?
Because I could, you know, I just wanted to show a picture of the guy, and he was like, hey, I don't want any publicity on it. But he was getting tons of publicity on this.
Yeah, but he wants it all generated from himself, I suppose.
Well, I'm going to tell you something, sir. She's grounded, as far as I'm concerned. No dating until I speak with you. She is officially grounded from dating with you. And that's all I have to say about it. All right?
Oh, you're taking this very lightly, Howard. I'm not.
Oh. Oh, you're upset. Good.
Yeah, I'm not taking it very
I told you that I should clear all your
all.
Dates. I told you I should clear all your dates. Thank you. I'm going to call back as Esther Roll. Or Jack Hay. I'll say I'm Jack Hay.
What is your Esther Roll impression?
Hello! Who am this? And this is that Michael Swan I read about you in Another World. I won't date you.
How's that?
Sounds good to me.
Yeah.
Hey, don't you give me no lip balm. I'm next. Yeah, and don't you tell me you're dating sci-fi. You go out with me. It's the rule. I don't want to hear about it.
Okay.
I thought they didn't want the two things confused.
Yeah. Yeah, right. After I hung up the phone with you that day, I said to myself, this don't sound right. This is awfully fishy. But I didn't want to get too into it. You know what I mean? I was like, yeah, I don't know. You know, I think love is blinding Robin here.
No. It sounds like a reasonable thing to me. I don't want anything confused either.
Right. Okay. We'll take that up tomorrow. Can't have a discussion with an answering machine.
No discussion necessary.
Sounds awfully like when you cut off Frank Gannon. I'm hearing some anger in that voice. I like your feisty.
No discussion necessary. Who the does he think he is?
Ah, I sense a pattern going here. All right. He said, hey, there's no discussion necessary of our relationship.
And from now on, no more publicity.
So, you know, I kept my mouth shut. Robin called me and said, hey, guy's getting upset about it, doesn't like all the attention.
But I didn't like it either.
Yeah. There you go. Well, we'll get an don't worry, I'll get you a full explanation. You don't even need to say anything.
Why do I need an explanation?
I need one.
One article too many.
One too many, and that's it. All right. Could say some nice things about you, though.
Big deal.
Exactly.
It's just like the Donald said. Well, it could have been worse if he'd said bad things.
There you go. Model your life after the Donald. All right. I hope your family isn't listening today because they're going to be upset about all of this.
Why should they be upset?
I want them to have a good time with the show.
Well, they were having fun up until now, I suppose.
All right. When we come back, we'll continue the news for you. Also, a guy from the ACLU wants to speak to me about this case that you brought up in the news.
Ah. ACLU?
Yeah.
What do they want?
The one about the lesbian lover.
Yeah?
Yeah. Wants to discuss
They've got
it.
Some views?
Yeah, I'll give him my views if he wants them. We'll be back right after this.
94W1. Classic rock and roll all day.
Oh, I have an opening.
Yeah, there is an opening in your schedule. Hi, you're on the air.
Hi, Howard. It's John Rosenbaum with the ACLU.
All right.
I just want to talk to you a little bit about that Denver case you were talking about.
Hey, what do you guys think of... I'm thinking of, like, donating some money to ACLU because they would defend me, wouldn't they, in the First Amendment issue?
Well, I don't know. Yeah?
Yeah. Sure. I think we need to be on their team.
Usually we don't agree with them most of the time.
Yeah, but I don't care. Here's one time when you need them, though.
Yeah.
If you don't have them when you need them, you know, what the hell good is it?
That's right.
Actually, most of our clients don't agree with us on most of our issues.
Right. But you need an organization like them around, or else, you know, all these nutbags are going to take over the country.
Well, that's true.
You sort of need somebody extremist on the other side.
In every case.
Yeah.
That's what we always say, is that if we went out of business tomorrow, somebody would reinvent us, because, you know, there's always a need for the ACLU.
All right, so what's your problem with what I said?
You just didn't have all the facts.
The
woman who wanted to leave, she had plenty of sick leave. They just wouldn't let her take it. To go visit her life partner.
But
well,
why
I said
would you?
That.
But why wouldn't we did say that? Why wouldn't you just say in your job, "Hey, I'm not feeling well. You call in. I'm sick. I'll be back in a few days." Why is everything got to be an issue with
why
lesbians?
Why should you have to lie though?
I don't know whether she had to lie.
Because
or not.
No one, a city worker or a private worker, should not be allowed all of this time off to go take care of sick people.
That's very well may be, but the city had a policy.
City has got to stop with those policies.
Well,
the city is bleeding us taxpayers dry.
Well, okay, but that's not what the case was about.
Yeah, I got you. In other words, if it's fair for heterosexuals, why isn't it fair for homosexuals?
Exactly.
I'm saying it's fair for no sexuals.
Well, you know, that's a different argument. And
they need to go out in the private sector, these union guys who work for the city, and remember that they're working for the taxpayer. When you ask for a raise, who do you think you're bleeding? You're bleeding taxpayers. I can't believe what we're paying in taxes. I don't believe what comes out of our checks. I got to get a job as a waiter so I can make some cash and tips.
So you can sit by your girlfriend's bed?
Right.
No, I mean, I agree with you. There are a lot of problems with, you know, the way...
I know where you guys are coming from. If heterosexuals get it, why don't homosexuals?
Yeah,
I got it. I'm all for that. Okay, all right. We got no problem. All right, John. Very good.
Yeah, because I basically think these points were made by Howard during his argument with himself.
Yeah, John.
didn't need you.
I argued all this already. I'm way on top of you.
All right.
All right, John.
Thanks.
Very good. There he is. John Rosenthal, ACLU. He had no beef with me.
No.
I'm looking for beefs. Did you see that guy out in the hall, that little skinny guy?
No.
You know who that guy is?
Who?
That's the guy with that real deep voice, the production director over at WYSP.
I didn't see him.
The guy goes, classic rock.
Bring him in here.
You got to wait till you see this guy. He looks like... And you got an opening in your schedule.
Oh,
maybe his voice will turn you on. Gary, bring in that guy. You just got to check this guy's voice out. Makes me feel like a woman.
Oh.
You know, whenever I think my voice is deep, it's not.
Then this guy comes along.
Yeah.
Where is he? I just saw Gary run by.
Yeah. There he goes. I hear him. I hear him running around out there.
Gary's scurrying around.
Rrr, rrr. All I hear is, rrr, rrr, rrr.
He's in a panic.
Yeah.
Buoy.
Doesn't know which way to go.
And very heavy footsteps. Boy, we're getting him well trained. Rrr, rrr.
A buoy.
You got to see this guy.
Well, he's like I don't know if it's going to happen today.
The guy who opens his mouth and suddenly he's got balls down to the floor. I was like, how you doing, Howard? Hey, how come our thing doesn't work anymore?
What thing?
The harmonizer. Only get in one channel. Probably doing something in the production. Yeah, well...
Oh, whenever they do something in the production studio, they have to take that out of one channel?
Yeah, I don't know why it can't be built into the board. Oh, well. We should have the harmonizer right here so I could screw with it right on the air.
But then they wouldn't have it in there.
They don't know what to do with it anyway. Well, here he is. All right, hey, look at this guy, Robin. I mean, he's not a bad-looking guy or anything, but you'd look at him and you'd go, hey, okay, regular guy.
Yeah, that guy should have a voice like this.
All right. Say something.
Hi there, Howard. How you doing?
Oh, man. Are you kidding? That's wild.
Say something else.
What would you like me to say? Would you like me to... How about if I do a 92.3... YSP, how about if I do something like that for you?
You know what it is? I knew a guy like
this
in college.
That's amazing. He's froggy.
How old are you?
Just turned 24. About, 2 or 3 weeks ago.
Oh, man. That's why in our industry, you do not need college. Did you go to college?
About 2 years of college.
Yeah, you didn't need to waste your time.
They gave you this voice?
Exactly. Right. No, yes, exactly.
But he's putting it on a little bit. You know, 2 years of college.
2 years of college. No.
Well, he's learned to speak radio.
Yes, it's...
Can you talk higher if you try?
Why, sure.
You know what it is? It's almost annoying to listen to him.
Yeah.
Well, you once made the point... guys like that, those are the voices that always did commercials.
Yeah.
And when you hear their voice, you immediately want to tune out.
Right.
Because they sound like the guy in the commercial.
Good point.
Yeah, I mean,
it doesn't even sound like he's having a real conversation in a real conversation.
But my father used to say to me, he says, college to be in radio, he says, you could have a guy who's a guy who works in a laundromat be in radio if he's got a good voice.
Right.
That's what our industry is. It's a stupid industry.
This is our profession.
Yeah. Yeah, we're all stupid guys. We're all stupid guys.
Although I have a theory that one day they will invent a machine that will sound just like the human voice that can lower my voice to that pitch.
Yeah?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Well, you know.
What are they'll be looking for?
So I'll be able to talk like him and I won't even need to have a deep voice.
Okay.
A boy.
So you will be eliminated.
Wow. I knew a guy like this in college. We were in freshman year. No, okay, we were in our junior year. During the summer, he used to get great jobs in, like, Rhode Island, on radio, FM radio stations, the number one station in the market. They would hire him. He had the same voice you did. Wish I could think of that guy's name. I wonder what happened to him.
So you're right out of college, and you work for WYSP.
Right, that's home base, right.
Right, home base.
And then
home
they fly him around doing what?
Doing voice work, you know, different stations. I have a side business that I do as well.
Oh, my God.
Do stuff.
Listen to that,
Howard. Isn't that great?
Oh, this is sick.
And you know what's great about it? I knew this guy. So this guy would come into college class after the summer, and he'd walk in, and he'd be so full of himself, because at some point during the class, you would know that he was working. Like, it was a joke that he was even in the class.
Yeah.
He knew more than the professor, because he got great jobs. Not that he had a lousy personality and everything. I wish I could think of that guy's name. I'd like to know what he's doing now.
You don't do an air shift.
No air shift.
He doesn't need to.
No,
I don't waste my time with that. I mean, you get a lot of commercial work and everything, right?
Right.
Your voice just doesn't match.
I know.
The way you look.
That's what everybody
says. I figured
says.
There's something in his throat. He had something artificially implanted.
But that's how this other guy was. He'd walk in and you'd sit there in class and go, oh, man, this is such a joke. At what age was your voice like that?
You know, actually, I got into radio before it changed. You know, the average age, what, 16? What is it for guys?
He's even distracted by his own voice. Yeah. You know, he's like, ah. He can't even believe it. Because it sounds so good, right?
He's hypnotizing himself.
It's fun just to hear that,
That's right. I turn myself on every day, Howard.
It's Howard.
And you certainly can't do comedy with that voice.
No.
No, you just can read neat stuff. Hey, give out the number for Physician Smoke Stopping Group. Just here.
Okay. Just see what you got.
It's the underlying phone number. Just the phone number.
At the very bottom here?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Keep it up.
Call 212-794-2200.
Yeah.
How's that? Is that announcer enough?
He's even got the smile going
on. Yeah. And he acts like he was in the old days of radio. He's putting his hand up to his ear.
Yeah, that makes no difference, by the way. When you got a voice like that, you can put your hand in your nose. It doesn't make a difference. you still sound good. Damn, you're lucky. That's called God giving you a special little thing.
Giving you a gift.
Absolutely. Giving you a free living. So all you got to do is walk around all day and audition.
Yeah. I mean, he walks into an audition, they give him the job.
Yeah. You pretty much land, what, one out of how many auditions?
You know...
Give me an estimate.
To be honest with you, I don't do a lot of auditions.
I knew it.
It comes out where they will call you, you know, they know what you sound like, and they just, you know, they'll call you and have you do the job.
Can you do a couple of different reads? I mean, are you like,
You know, there's limits as to, you know, the style.
Okay, all right, I can't take it.
This is sick.
Oh, this is too weird.
And he's
weird.
Only 24, talking like that. It sounds like he's 40 years old.
Do you have a bucket full of genitals? Or
why?
Do you have unusually large balls? Seriously.
You know, everybody asks that question, too, Howard.
Do you?
Actually, I haven't compared him to other men. But,
no, but I mean, you've seen in a shower.
Why?
This guy looks like a little kid, though. That's the funny thing.
I know.
Looks like a punk.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
But you would think
this guy, Ernie Anderson, is that his name?
Yeah.
Ernie Anderson.
He probably trembles knowing that you're around the corner.
Can you say the love boat?
He's the love boat.
What is he, Gary?
I guess he just called back.
Who?
Mr. Swan.
Oh.
What does he want?
Who wants to talk to him? He wants to defend himself. I don't know him why, but he said he has a defense.
Yeah, right. He's got a lawyer now.
Hold on, I'll get back to you in a second.
We may need you.
Yeah.
introduce, and now, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Michael Swan from the soap opera Another World.
And now, ladies and gentlemen.
No.
Well, what is it?
At least get it
as
right.
The world
if he's going to get all this publicity.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay, now, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Michael Swan from the soap opera As the World Turns.
Wow.
Jesus. Good reverb, too.
Yeah,
thank you. That I control.
You helped him a little.
Michael Swan from the soap opera As the World Turns. Also involved with Robin Quivers.
No. His business is his business is being on As the World Turns.
Right.
Yeah. Is this the head potentate?
This is the head muckety muck.
All right.
Well, all right. Listen now.
What does this article say? I haven't seen it. I have no idea what
now, it's an article written by you.
Oh.
Where you talk about your love relationship on the camera and your relationship with Robin.
And
but
it
you're
has
the guy
my name on the byline, is that it?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, what magazine is it in?
It's in Soap Opera Digest.
Soap Opera Magazine.
Soap Opera Magazine?
Yeah.
Christ. All right, what's
well, you got a pretty nice thing going with Robin, right?
Well, I'm enjoying it.
Right.
Apparently, you know, one of the first things Robin told me on our first date was...
And you're one of the lucky
we're
men
very vindictive people.
Right.
So...
So watch the... Ouch, okay.
So I guess this is the beginning.
Well, you know, the thing is that he have this relationship going with her, which, you know, we're joking around about having a good time with. But then you start freaking out and saying to everybody, hey, man, I don't want any more publicity on this.
No.
You're writing articles about it.
No, wait a minute. I didn't write any articles, Howard.
We called over
the article. I don't know who put my name there, but I did not write any articles.
When I say we, our TV show got the bright idea, and I didn't even know about it, but they wanted to call
over.
Yeah,
you didn't know about it, and they called my executive producer.
Right.
And that wasn't my decision. In fact, he called me, and I said, look, it's your decision. You do what you want.
Yeah.
So he said, well, I don't want to send him a piece of tape because then I'll have no control over it.
Right.
And I said, fine, that's your
Yeah, we wouldn't have done anything. We just wanted to see what you look like.
Hey, I'm telling you, it was his decision. I have no control over that.
So everybody got a little sensitive. So I said, okay, no more. And Robin said, hey, I don't want any more publicity on this.
No, neither of us do, really. Right.
Robin hasn't done anything.
One of us is not being quoted everywhere.
I got a feeling I'm going to hear every stinking detail now. I'm going to get everything out of you. As long as you're getting all this attention, we might as well use it to our benefit, too.
Whatever you guys want to do, listen.
What's the story with you, man? Have you made a move on her or what?
What kind of a move did you have?
Besides making out.
Excuse me, but this is not what we call to talk about.
Excuse me, Robin. I'm conducting an interview now.
Oh, no, you're not.
Every day she's in the office with longing in her eyes. I'm wondering if you're giving her the kielbasa.
I beg your pardon.
Would that be a crazed kielbasa?
Boy, I'm telling you something. Robin's a little firecracker. She could teach you a few things.
I have no doubt about it.
Thanks a lot.
Oh, man. Well, what is with you, man? I mean, it's already 6 or 7 days.
No, we want to know what is with you about all these articles.
Yeah, what is with you with all those articles?
You.
As far as I'm concerned, it's over. And I don't know anything about
this. Right. Yeah, I've heard that one too many times.
What do you mean you didn't know anything about it?
Hey,
you wrote it.
You guys know this business. There's a delay effect here. If I say three sentences to three different people that write tabloids or whatever they write, you know it's going to be in twice as many magazines and it's going to be embellished upon until it wears out, no matter what I say, how little I say.
Do me a favor. Read to us from the article you're currently writing.
Right, yeah. Tell us what you just have in the word processor now.
Yeah.
So we'll know before it hits the stand.
Hey, you just scorned this woman. She's really angry. Mm. Well, he's claiming, Robin, and it could be true. I will give him that.
Oh, now you're going to tell
he
me.
Is
Nobody
claiming,
has been scorned.
He is claiming that he did, you know, a few interviews initially, and that this is coming back to haunt him. But yet it's got his byline.
Well, one wonders why he was giving interviews in the first place.
I think what Robin's saying is, do you love Robin
I
for Robin?
Believe, I can't wait.
Love?
Excuse me, Robin. Do you love Robin?
It says how I handle it on and off the screen.
Oh, my God.
By ATWT's Michael Swan.
I have no defense except that I knew nothing about it.
Hey, how do you handle it on and off screen? Black-White Romance is No Problem for Me by Michael Swan. Man, I date Robin Quivers. We've had 5 or 6 dates. We enjoy each other's company. It's nothing hot or heavy. Why not? We're good friends. You guys are just good friends?
Well, we were until today.
Oh, man. Robin's waiting for it.
Excuse me?
Yeah,
how do you know?
Me.
What do you know about me?
Yeah. I know enough
you
about
over
you.
Over there.
I've known you for a lot longer than Michael Swan. So what's your story, man? Now, do you like
this
Robin?
This is not what we're talking about. I have to consider here that this is media bonanza for you.
Yeah, like we have discussed on how common our audiences are.
Yeah, but this
isn't
in...
what?
This
there's
is
no buts. We don't have...
No,
our
no,
audiences
no,
have
excuse
nothing
me,
to do with each
excuse
other.
Me. Well, then why is my name always in these things? I don't need to be in soap opera magazine.
No, you don't. And I've explained to you countless times that this is a delay from the first setup when we first started going out.
Hmm.
Well, I don't see how that could be.
Well,
this is a little
I'll
love
tell you
respect.
Right now, I didn't write any articles.
Well, I mean, you know, the five or six dates isn't like the first time.
That's true.
Yeah, that's true.
That is true. She's got you there, my friend.
She's got me there.
Hey, let me tell you something, Robin. You're right. You just hit it on the head.
What, am I stupid?
You want a new article? Here's an article you can write. Then the minx called me on the air. Oh, it got my rocket crazy. My pants were exploding. I'll have to spank her and ride her hard the next time I see her for calling me on the air.
Okay, now, did I just write that?
No.
Are you going to put that down with my bio?
What, did you not get the last line? Give him the last line again.
Yeah, here, write this down. I'll tell you one thing: if you were nailing her, it's over. If you were getting some of that fine gaijis, it's over. And I hope you're not acting out your Tamara fantasies with Robin. Hey, let me ask you something: do you love Robin for Robin, or do you love Robin?
No, he loves me for you. I think
you
he's
love
sending
me?
You his picture.
You guys.
He's you know, he's just using me for publicity and to get to you.
Robin's feeling like she's being used for publicity.
Well. She's wrong, and I've, you know, explained to her that why would I do that? Look at it from the very first day.
Go ahead.
From the initial the initial situation where I asked Allison Jones,
assistant
coordinator,
yes,
to introduce me to Robin.
Right.
That was that. She said she'd see what she could do.
Right. In other words, you didn't
even ask. Next thing I know, I'm on my stage doing my show. And they come running in saying, Joan wants to put you on the air and introduce you to Robin.
Hmm.
And they came and got me off my stage and ran me over to their stage.
Of course.
It was not my idea.
Right, but it wasn't your idea to be on the show. You wanted to...
I just wanted to meet Robin.
Right.
That was it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're trying to ruin my career. You've gotten all your publicity, now you're trying
to
ruin
my career. Oh, wait a second. I'm listening here.
That's so, it. I mean, you know, I have nothing more to say.
If
Robin is truly angry, then there's nothing I can do about it, and I'm sorry.
Wow. This guy is a guy who gets a lot of trim, so you didn't have to be that sorry. It has to be great to feel her up, though.
Oh, God.
Hey, come on. Let me just ask you.
No.
It's got to be wild.
You know what, Howard?
What?
We've worked together a long time.
It has to be great.
You could blow it all now.
Oh, there you go. Everybody's blowing it today. It has to be wild.
We got to get back to this guy with the deep voice over here.
Yeah. I know he's touched your chests. I know it. I can tell just by the way you just reacted.
Why do you say that?
I can just tell. Who gets on top between you two?
Between us is another girl, Tamara.
Tamara. Do it feel gushy or more like a pillow? So what do you think? It's over, Robin, between you two? Is that what you're saying? Are you breaking up or are you accepting?
I'm sure she and I will discuss this later.
Will there be a discussion later, or are you not accepting phone calls from
her? Well, she will either accept or not accept a phone call from me later.
Are you going to call?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Can we tape the phone call?
No, you may not. Because I will use the...
Because he'll be using it for his next article.
Do you ever...
Yes, I will.
He has an exclusive already with Soap Opera Digest.
I'm going to start my own bloody... tablet.
You've been in the you get enough press out of this. No, sometimes, you know, someone could look at this and say, hey, this guy, he's getting a lot of press out of this. Does he love her or does he love the press?
Well, nobody's talking about love here.
Well, I think
Howard, let me toot
right,
my own
like
for about the next 20 minutes.
All right, go ahead.
Okay.
Oh, God, here we go.
Go ahead, toot your own horn.
In the soap opera industry, don't need to go to the radio industry for press.
Oh, you feel the soap operas are higher than...
No, not at all. They're just two completely different audiences, particularly your show.
Right, okay.
Okay. Entertainment Tonight isn't coming to do me tomorrow on my show because I see Robin.
Right.
Okay. Oh, could you manage to keep that out of the conversation, though?
Are they coming to see you tomorrow?
Believe me, I will. Trust me.
Is Entertainment...
It will not be in the conversation.
Is Entertainment Tonight coming to see you tomorrow?
Yeah, they're going to come and interview me over on my show.
Oh, but it's about the show. That's what I mean.
No, it's about being in such good shape.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
I mean, you are in pretty good shape.
For an old guy.
Sounded like Johnny Carson. You ever been married?
All right, enough already.
Why?
Maybe he's married now.
Is he married? You're married?
Jesus.
He didn't call for an interview.
You got a big penis?
He's interviewing with Entertainment Tonight.
Oh. Well, then I
not here.
Boy, you know what? Someone who's mad at him, you're still protective of him.
Oh, yeah.
I've never seen you
before. I hope I'm never.
Man.
That angry.
We'll see. I tell you,
sounds to me like you two kids are going to be talking later.
Soap Opera Magazine, that's what it's called, because that's a new publication.
You would have called them, but you
yeah, you didn't know to call them. So, Robin, it sounds like his excuse is that this is from an old interview, but you point out, hey, wait a second, this is no old interview.
Yeah, you know, I keep hearing the same story every time a new article comes out.
Right. Five or six dates is new, because that's how many dates you've actually had.
There's a delay. You guys know there is. You know how this works.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're talking about 3 weeks.
Well, you told me the last one was the last one.
No, well, I was hoping so. Mm-hmm. I mean, geez, I mean, look at the quality of the rags that are creating the story.
Hmm. All right, listen, I don't know what Robin thinks. Guilty. Guilty is right. Sounds to me like you're still talking to the press, which, you know, hey, as long as you guys don't make a big deal about it, then go ahead and talk to the press. But at some point, Robin wants some more. She doesn't want...
Excuse me,
I am not talking. At some point, she wants a man who just wants to ravish her and not be interviewed by the press all the time, after every date. You know, next interview will be, well, we had 7 dates, and here's the latest update. So, you know, do your thing. You know, you're like Liberace saying, I don't want anyone to notice my clothes. Every time you go out on a date, it's in the newspaper. I got a woman over here who's upset. She's sticking pins in a Michael Swan doll as we speak, doing some kind of weird chanting over in the corner. So I don't want, I don't understand this. I say if a guy wants Robin, shouldn't have articles every 5 minutes. Now, you two get it together.
Is that
well, if you want to continue banging my co-hostess,
I beg
you better, you better, well, whatever you're doing, or touching her chest, you better just behave yourself. Stop with all the articles. See, we wouldn't mind the articles if you didn't make such
Howard,
a big deal about
it. I'm not writing the articles.
We wouldn't mind. I don't know when you got
I'm
into
doing
this
good for you. Let me handle it.
Because
you're crumbling already. I hear you gushing over there.
Get out of here.
Listen, you're just annoyed because my executive producer turned you guys down for the piece of tape.
No. I was not involved in
that. I think everybody's doing a lot of speculating and they don't know what they're talking
right.
about.
I'm the only one who knows what I'm talking about.
Well,
right. Okay.
Just remember that. As long as I'm on the air.
That's it.
All right. So you love Robin or not?
Oh,
do you love Robin?
No. I can answer that for you.
No, I didn't ask you. Do you love Robin? Do you love her?
Yes.
I'm asking you a question, Mike.
I've heard you 4 times. You've noticed I haven't answered you.
Well, in other words, you're falling in love with her?
Oh, will you get off the phone? Can't you hang up?
Are you in love with her?
See, you're going to start answering questions again.
Are you in love with Robin?
This is exactly how he winds up doing these
interviews.
I want
to know your intentions. Are you in love with Robin?
He stays on the phone.
Are you in love with Robin or not?
All right, Michael. See you later.
Why are you embarrassed by that, Robin?
You will be hearing from me.
I think he's in love with you.
Please.
Do you love Robin?
No.
Yes. How many times are you going to ask that question?
You're not going to answer?
No, obviously not. You've asked it 6 times.
If Robin wasn't yapping away there, I could have had an answer.
No, it's not my show. I don't have to fill the dead air.
I'll take control of this relationship because I'll tell you something, Robin. If you were in control, he wouldn't be shooting his mouth off to the newspapers. So let me handle it.
Oh, God.
Listen, I'm going to tell you the way I see it. If you really have feelings for her, and if you really enjoy her company, let's see you stop blabbing to the newspaper about it and go private a little bit. Because a girl starts to think... A girl starts to think that, like, maybe you're just using it for the publicity. All right? Now, I'll give you another chance. But if we see one more article with you blabbing away about the dates, then it's open season.
Robin's well, I hope you two have a good time.
Robin's going to start blabbing away on here.
I hope you two enjoy each other.
Amour. My sister wants a date. She really does. Well, hubba hubba. And she don't care how many newspaper articles you write.
You can write an article after every second.
You can write a friggin' book. My sister wouldn't care.
She's not going to question a
thing. Oh, no, not at all. All right, dude.
All right, the word is out, Howard and Robin. As far as I'm concerned, there will be no more press.
All right.
All right?
You're married?
I'll talk to you later, Robin.
All right. Robin, are you going to say anything? Goodbye to your man?
We have to finish the news.
You're not talking? Oh, you're still mad. She likes to be mad. She wants to make up with you.
All right.
So oh, he knows me so
yeah,
well.
Yeah, I do.
So well.
All right, man. There'll be a big discussion later.
We'll let you know the outcome.
We will. There he goes, getting press again.
Yep.
Oh,
can I read it in Soap Opera Digest?
No. I'm going to put it on page 6 this time. I have such
good
control over the press.
Good.
Mm-hmm.
I have perfect control over it.
All right, very good.
Exactly what I tell them to do.
All right, very good.
Okay.
All right, bye-bye. Bye. There he is, Michael Swan, former boyfriend of Robin. And who knows, maybe they'll make up tonight. Interesting to talk to your man, one of your men. But a privilege I don't often get. You can call me Kreskin, Robin, but I think he's out there alerting the media right now about your phone conversation tonight.
I think he was already hooked in.
Yeah.
I think that went right down the phone line to several different newspapers.
That was a conference call.
Yeah, there was a conference call.
Right, we were directly hooked in.
Hello, South Fire Digest. I can give you a direct conference call to my appearance on the Howard Stern Show. If I am given an exclusive...
Give me a guaranteed cover.
Right. Guaranteed covered with my shirt off. This guy loves press.
Oh.
And you can't tell me now he doesn't.
No, I wouldn't.
Thank you.
I'm not ever going to tell you that again.
Thank
Howard.
You.
You have proven me wrong.
Thank you, Robin. I said there's something fishy with this guy. I told her that. She thinks I'm just trying to keep her away from all men. When I find the right man for her, I'll know it.
Yeah, but you're not looking.
No one's good enough. Want to say something, my friend?
Hey,
yeah, don't you have anything to add to this?
Robin, I'm just enjoying the show.
Listen to this guy. He's really annoying. You got to picture a guy.
He'll certainly take us out of this particular segment of the show with that voice.
So you work for YSP full time?
Right, right.
Well, but all you do is commercials for them?
All I do is promos and then sweepers in Washington, JFK, and then...
And you sit there?
Right.
How long does it take you to do that?
All day.
It's, really?
It's a, where are you
very,
from?
Very hard job. I came from Detroit to here.
Right.
I was in Detroit before.
There's no accent. Right. That's a perfect
there's
place to
come. There's some construction guy out right. there listening. Oh, yeah, he right. sits there and talks. That's a very hard job.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Break a sweat every now and then.
Hey, how about Mr. Big Voice as a husband for you or some kind of lover? He's not a bad-looking kid.
I don't know. How clued in are you to the press?
And, yeah. And I promise no articles for me.
No articles.
No articles.
You'll be on the phone with the Philadelphia Inquirer.
I know what you're saying to yourself, Robin. What's with this guy? Is he into me or is he into the press? I got you. I'm with you.
Well, gee, Howard, that's very astute.
I know.
Of
I'm
you.
Being serious. No, I'm being serious.
You know, I was being going. Subtle. So I'm surprised you picked it up.
Although you could lay back and just enjoy it, because the guy's a good-looking hunk. And maybe say, hey, let him get what he wants out of it. I'm getting what I want. I'm getting mine. I'm getting Michael Bossy.
Is this the guy that your voice friend spoke about?
Is that some old
no,
friend of yours from college?
Yeah, he would know the big deep voice guy.
Oh, this guy thought he was the deep voice guy.
Did he call you and think he was the deep voice guy?
Somebody called John and gave him that message, but he was the deep voice
guy. No, he knows he's not. Ask him who that kid was. He used to dress real weird, and he had, like, straight hair that was combed over the side like Veronica Lake.
But a great voice.
Unbelievable voice.
I'm just wondering, are you wearing that dicky because you like to protect your vocal cords there?
Yeah, he's wearing a dicky.
A dicky, yeah.
You're wearing a dicky.
I'll prove to you this is no
is that a dicky or a...
It's a real thing. It goes all the way down.
You're wearing a turtleneck to keep your throat warm, right?
Right, exactly. I mean, you've got to protect the
voice. His instrument, Howard.
Oh,
his instrument.
You know, the one curse with having a voice like that is you're constantly worrying
that's
about
right.
it.
That's right. Now, you don't smoke or
absolutely
any of that
no.
stuff.
Absolutely not.
No. Wow, what a voice. Imagine he's going to get older.
It's going to get better.
Yeah. Nice dicky.
Thank you for noticing that.
You've got a really nice dicky. Oh, my. It's some dicky, huh, Robin? All white like that.
Well, I noticed it.
You know who else has a nice dicky? Michael Swan.
Laugh at my expense, Howard. Go ahead. Yeah. I thought you were my friend.
I can understand
those other two guys.
I tried to steer you away from him.
That hurts.
I tried to steer you away from that guy.
That hurts, Howard.
I told her on the phone the other day. I go, don't listen to that guy. He's full of it. Anyway, Robin, let's wrap up the news. Let's keep going.
Let's see what's going on here. First of all.
You want to hang out in here, Deep Voice guy?
Hey, sure. Absolutely.
Oh, you do? Okay, absolutely. Well, you can sit here. I don't care.
Would you like to do a show like this one day?
Oh, it's my dream.
Really? No, your voice is too deep.
Yeah, that's true. It's a hindrance. You'll never be able to do it.
Yep.
Too distracting.
Can you imagine working with him and like, hey, so how you doing today?
Wearing a dickie. I'm wearing a dickie just to make sure that my voice is okay. Hey, who's deeper right now, me or you?
I'd have to say you win the battle.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, but you can't walk around with that on your back all day.
Oh, sure, I could. No problem. Hey, you do me a favor, man. You try and figure out what Fred does for us, and you can replace him. Yeah. How about it? Okay.
That sounds great.
Right. I mean, right.
Well, anyway, Howard, I have gotten a chance to look at this article on Channel 9.
Yeah.
And they do say some things about you.
What do they say?
First of all, they talk about all the local programming Channel 9 is getting into, and they just have this little description here. They say, this local independent station takes those words seriously. Programming shows made here for people here by people here, like Howard Stern blathering, Joe Franklin babbling, Jackie Mason bubbling, like the Gonzo Kitty Fest Steam Pipe Alley.
Yeah, isn't it great that we work at Channel 9? Look what we're in with. Let's point out that our show is the only one that's syndicated in all these markets.
Oh, goodness. So then down below, later in the article, they talk about Bob Woodruff starts to talk about us.
What does he say?
That's all that WWOR management needs to know. They embrace everybody from nostalgic talkmeister Joe Franklin to bad taste barometer Howard Stern with one simple mandate. Find unbridled talent and let it run.
Yeah, but that's not his quote. That's the newspaper.
No, that's the, yeah, but right. Then he goes on. Before Channel 9 adopted Stern in July 1990, the Fox stations had already tried to build a show around the quick-witted radio renegade, putting him behind a desk in typical talk show fashion.
Needless to say, Bob said
that,
right? Bob keeps bringing up the Fox thing. I wish he'd stop that.
You've got to take the person for what he is, Woodruff says.
The Fox thing would have flown just as much as this is flying. It was the same show.
You can't tell them this is the format of the show. You've got to let it evolve for them or from them. If you don't, you don't get a good show.
In other words, sit back and do nothing and hope that it evolves into something.
Right.
Yeah, no, that's not my idea, but all right.
And
at least
they say the show is syndicated in 60% of the country.
Bob's very complimentary to us, though.
We don't want to soften it up, become just mellow mush.
Right.
We want to take it to the edge.
See, that's what I like about him.
But not go over the edge.
Yeah, we're still trying to find that edge. I'm almost over the edge right now.
Yes, because of the nervous breakdown they're giving us.
Right.
But anyway, they say that Stern's Saturday Night Smut still isn't for everybody. But
right.
He's got his devotees.
Like every... who says that?
That's the
the
reporter again.
Yeah, well, thanks. Why is it called Smut? Why is that Smut? What was Smutty?
Well, I don't know.
Why
Maybe
am
she
I...
She thought the dominatrix was a bit much. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. But Donna used a lot to have dominatrixes on.
Yeah.
Yeah, go figure. You don't want a show like this, Deep Voice guy. What's your name, anyway?
I'm Paul Turner.
Oh, okay, Paul. Peace.
And the luxury of independence, of course, is that Stern gets to be Stern.
Paul Turner is your real name?
Right. No stage name.
All right. Well, you don't need one. You have one.
That's right.
Listen to that.
Yeah, there's a marker.
All right. Anything else, Robin?
Paul McCartney, new book.
Yeah.
You know, all these Beatles. What? There's no books on Ringo.
Yeah, notice that. Paul Ringo.
Not one book on Ringo.
Not one stinking book. Who wants to read about him?
He's like, hey, where's my book?
I once saw a pamphlet on Ringo. That was about
a
it.
A leaflet.
A leaflet. But no book. Yeah, I know. There's like volumes on Paul McCartney, volumes on John Lennon.
Yeah.
Even George Harrison
Even
might
George
have some.
George Harrison has a couple of books.
Ringo, you poor bastard. A pamphlet. What is it, my man?
Is that the guy's name?
No. That's not the guy.
All right, we'll work on it later.
Yeah.
What's he doing now?
I don't know. That's what I want to find out.
Well, anyway, this new book on Paul, you know, goes over a lot of the same old dirt, you know, about how he's one of the richest men in rock and roll, but he's really cheap.
Yeah.
And at the very beginning, when the Beatles were first making money, he kept money in rolls of 10 and 20 pound notes.
Why is that?
That's a big revelation. This is what these books are up to.
They have nothing left.
Yet, even though he was making all that money, he sent his children to local schools. And he's had fallings out with several partners, including the late John Lennon and Denny Lane, over money.
Bennett said that he felt guilty every time, you know, now he feels guilty that John Lennon died and he wasn't on good terms with him, so now...
Right, he claims that they were on good terms when he died.
Oh, yeah?
But all the other books, like the Fred Seaman book that just came out, and a couple of other people say they had not had a reconciliation and that he carries this secret guilt.
Mm-hmm.
That his relationship with Yoko Ono isn't any good. In fact, once he was finishing up a phone conversation with her about buying the rights to the Beatles song catalog, and they couldn't come to an agreement over it, and he got off the phone and called Yoko a cow. But Yoko gets off easier than his wife Linda, who is characterized as a super groupie, who even after marriage wore a bikini late into pregnancy because she feared that Paul would run off with other groupies.
That would drive me to other groupies. Seeing Linda pregnant in a bikini? Oh yeah, she was nervous, huh?
Yeah, apparently Paul was known for never having met a groupie he couldn't love.
Hey, would any guy be any different? Young guy, all that fame? Well, I'm banging everybody.
And then they also say that he had this farm in Scotland that Jane Asher had, you know, decorated really well. And then Linda got into the house and put pets and livestock in it, forcing visitors to sleep on dirty mattresses and creating such a mess that once one of the guys in Wings took a handful of fresh eggs and smashed them on the kitchen wall in protest.
All
so
right.
I guess those are the allegations that they're kind of sloppy and slovenly.
I'll have to run out and buy that book.
Yeah, you don't want to miss all those revelations.
Yeah, that's pretty wild stuff.
The Fisher King was the number one movie at the box office this weekend. That's the new Robin Williams film. I understand it's pretty good. I haven't seen it yet.
A lot of people tell me that, even Chiasano told me that he thought that the guy was like me.
Jeff Bridges' character.
He says he even wears the same watch you wear.
Well, now
I said, yeah, but that makes sense. I mean, the guy kept trying to come up here and meet me, and they kept the movie company kept calling and saying, "Can we have tapes of your show so that Jeff Bridges can study them?" So we said, "Pass." First of all, they said schmucks. All they had to do was tape me.
Yeah, why would you have to ask?
But they called and asked. I must have a lawsuit there somewhere, right? They called and asked. We told them no, and then they went ahead and did it anyway.
But they, you know, can you really say that they're depicting you on the screen?
No, of course not.
And it hasn't had any adverse effect on your career, so where's the suit?
Well, that's what I'm saying. That's why you don't see me in court instead of being here. Seems like there should be a suit.
Yeah.
Everybody else has got one.
What is Ricochet? That was number two at the box office. I think that's that new Denzel Washington film.
Yeah, Ricochet.
Deceived. The new Goldie Hawn film is number three.
Now, what's the reviews on that?
They've been mixed. Some people like Goldie in this, some people don't.
She's looking awfully old.
Oh.
She's losing her looks. I like that.
And then number four is Necessary Roughness. That's that film with the model on the football team. Weird listing of top 10 movies this week.
I'll stay home.
And The Super is number five. That's the new Joe Pesci film. Actually got a good review.
It did?
Yeah. Huh. American men are interested in money, family, sex, and sports in that order. How closely do they align themselves with women's interests? Not too. Women are interested in family, money, health, and reading.
Yeah. We have a lot of magazines in my house. My wife does read a lot.
Well, at least you're both interested in family and money.
Yeah.
Then you go your separate ways because you start thinking about sex.
Right.
And she starts thinking about health.
I think the way she thinks about health all the time. And she thinks about sex when she thinks that I'm just gotten so super horny that maybe she better do something for me. Not that she gets horny.
Oh, dear.
All right.
Well, that was in a Sports Illustrated survey of the American male, 1991. So there you have it, folks. On the talk shows today... Donahue, Arthur Shelby Steele, who's that? I don't know. Oprah Winfrey wishing parents would divorce. That ought to be interesting. Kids telling their parents to get a divorce.
How do they find them for that show?
I don't know. Did you see the group yesterday? The women who had been sexually abused while they were hypnotized?
Yeah, I saw them.
That was amazing.
Yeah, it's amazing that a guy would go out of his way for those women.
Well, but the guy was 74. They kept pointing
that. Oh, I see. Yeah, they better point that out. I'm tuning in. I go, if I was going to risk my whole career, I don't know that I'd hypnotize these beauties. But okay, listen, takes all types.
So anyway, that's what's happening, folks.
Very good, Robin. 1044, 92.3 KROQ, WYSP, WJFK. We want to thank our friend Peter Gunn. What is it?
Close. Paul Turner.
Paul Turner.
Where'd you get Peter Gunn?
I don't know. I knew it was some kind of name. Jackie Penhouse, Joke Page, Martling. Hey, you want to read the plugs?
Sure.
All right.
Oh, yeah, there we get some professional plugs at the end of the show.
Watch this.
Nice and slow.
Okay, nice and slow. This is promoting the show tomorrow, right?
Yes.
Jackie Penhouse, Joke Page, Martling. And tomorrow night, October the 9th, the big show at Bananas Comedy Club in the Radisson Hotel. Poughkeepsie, New York. Am I saying that right? I'm not from New York.
Poughkeepsie.
Poughkeepsie, New York. Okay, for jokes and info, dial 516-922-WINE. W-I-N-E. And Jackie's 13th Wild Party cassettes are available at Old Tower Records.
He's like Shadow Stevens.
And it's Sam Goody's. Shadow Stevens. Not quite as good looking, though, right?
No, you sound like him. I'd say he's good looking, though.
Well.
Go ahead. What's the next one?
Sam Goody's on both coasts.
Right.
That's the end.
All right. Now read the next ones, a little more briskly, like a professional.
A little more briskly. Okay, Boy Gary, this Friday night at the Trocadero in Philadelphia from 8 until 10 p.m. for the new happy hour at the Trocadero.
Baba Booey.
Good.
Baba Booey. All right. Don't miss Josie Sang this Thursday night at the grand opening of Giggles and Bits. That's at Red Robin Restaurant in Secaucus. And that's Saturday night at Dick Lee's in Philadelphia.
Dick Lee.
Dick Lee's in Philadelphia.
The stupid.
All right. Go ahead.
And this Thursday,
that
October the 10th.
Directed at you.
Yeah, not you.
Okay, you fooled me for a second. And this Thursday, October the 10th, you can meet Boy Gary, Stuttering John, and Jackie the Joke Man at the grand opening at the Grand Central Radio from 12:30 till 2:30. All right?
See how hard it is to read these plugs?
You do this much better.
I do.
He does, only his voice is much better.
He's got the voice.
Yeah.
That's my fate.
Yeah. But you practice reading his handwriting, see?
I see.
And that you got to have.
Oh, it's the handwriting.
It's the handwriting.
Okay, yeah, right. Guy writes neater than typewriter, and he's telling me the handwriting's a problem. Go ahead.
Pig Vomit tonight and every Tuesday at Dudley's. That's in New Rochelle.
You better take a reading course. Go ahead,
If you're planning a wedding or a party and you want a mobile DJ, call Scott the Engineer's Rocket Entertainment. That's at 718-BAG-5040.
Very good. Well, hey, very professional.
Hey.
There you go, everybody. That's the kind of voice
you
need.
Now you know what you need if you want to be in radio.
And avoid Fred Norris.
There it is. How'd that get in there? That's just a note I wrote to myself. That wasn't meant for air, Robin.
Now, okay. All right, let me do this. 92.3, K-Rock, YSP, JFK. Look, Joe Cocker.
What would you do with a voice like that?
I don't know. I'd probably work like 2 hours a day.
Yeah.
I'd just go out and do like a...
You'd have a studio in your house.
I'd do like a Wilson Golf Balls commercial, and that would be it. I'd go home, relax. I'd audition all day.
You wouldn't have to. Just wait for the call.
Right. Then I'd sing to myself the rest of the day. Which I knew the words of it. Oh, going home again. I'm going home. My baby just wrote me a letter. Yeah. Super. Clint Torres with you. How you doing, everybody? Yeah.